off week 8 with a look at our game of the week.
Thank you very much, Shox. I'm Devin Pyrotechnics Young here with Mitch Krepa Vorspuls and Martin DeFicio Linga as we get ready to look at this battle for fourth place. So waste no time. Let's start by dialing in on Giants Gaming. That means up in the top lane, you've got Wurlib in the jungle. It is Frederick, Pepinero the mid laner, Audrey the AD carry, God for their support, and their coach, Lothar.
Yeah, and with Giants here last week, we saw a little bit of a surprise. They have pulled out a few new picks, Pepinero often in the mid lane. Not always we agree with the pick, but we saw Galio top lane from Wurlib, and I quite like it. It was such a smart pick to protect his back line here against the dive combo we saw from Gambit.
Yeah, honestly, if somebody would have told me, hey, you're going to see Galio this weekend, we even joked about it before, like, no, hell no, we're not going to see Galio. But I really like the synergy with Morgana. You have the Idoldurand, and then just the shields from Galio coming out, and then you have the Black Shield working so well with that in unison, because the Gambit had very few interruptions for the Galio ultimate. If he got Black Shielded, there was no way to pop that, and that was just a good synergy. Double shield for your tank frontline Rek'Sai as well, and it showed that Giants are being innovative, and this is kind of reminds me of the Unicorns of Love kind of spring.
And I just think also it's key that they're not afraid of pulling out new picks, especially for Wurlib in that top lane, because he was, again, this is the Jax only guy. That's the only champion we've really seen him perform so well on. Yet, he has shown up on different picks. Shyvana top lane was one of the ones he introduced in Europe. He's important for this team. It's more than just Pepinero. If he can show up today, they can beat H2K.
Absolutely. And this would be the first time, if they do manage to beat him, 0-6 historically all time. This goes all the way back to expansion. They have not managed to take down this team, but they are looking the best they ever have to be able to accomplish it going forward. And there are their remaining games. They are going to need every single win on the board. H2K today, it all starts off, but they've also got Rocket, Unicorns, and the Copenhagen Wolves. So they aren't looking in too bad a shape to finish their run out and look for playoffs.
Some close matches, but if Giants turn up today and they have some progression in the last few weeks, if they can actually take this win against H2K, that means that the toughest task is out of the way, and nothing prevents them from then following up, going potentially 4-0, and then we could look at Giants challenging top three. This is a team that came into the league 10th place, complete candidate for auto relegation. Everybody had written them off, but Pepinero showed that it's no longer the Pepi show only. Like, Wurlib stepping up, Godfred has like this untouchable Morgana, 6-0 or something. Should be banned. Yeah, but it hasn't.
We'll have to see, guys. We're going to go ahead and take a look at their opponents, however, on the other side. H2K, they're in the red. They're defending their spot in third place at the moment. That means you've got Odawamne, Lulex, Ryu, Yarnin Kasing, and of course, Prawly. This is a team that's had some rough weeks, though, recently.
Yeah, the thing we used to praise H2K for were the lane swaps. They were so good at lane swap early game. They always got these early leads from it. We don't see that anymore. It's become too predictable. It's almost like they're lacking, or they're not adapting maybe to some of the changes, and every other team has somewhat caught up to what H2K was so good at in the start of the split.
Yeah, H2K's bread and butter was this immaculate early game, but right now when it fails and we actually have a replay of that moment when it actually doesn't go well, everything goes haywire, and this was last week against SK Gaming, or 2 weeks ago, and they just didn't know what to do. Look at Lulex, he's still level 2 at this point in the game, so this is phase 2 of a lane swap, and H2K loves to going for these 4-man dives, but SK, they were ready for it this time.
Yeah, you can see, first of all, top lane is being pushed in by Freddy, and SK, they know what's going on, so they start poking them out. There's no chance for Odawamne to help, and suddenly H2K just going for a very aggressive play, and Lulex is a guy we have to talk about a little bit more, because it's not always great. His games, yeah, chilling a little bit for himself, but Lulex in losses for H2K is dying so, so much. We've seen wins here at first. Okay, that's decent stats, but in losses, almost 6 deaths per game. That's too much for a guy who's playing on such a good team.
To be fair, H2K has compositions that revolve around Lulex being the single frontline tank. Very often we see this triple threat composition, you know, this support buddy roam system. But it's just not working out anymore. When they start losing, he's the only one in the front line. He starts getting caught out as well.
Yeah.
In addition to that, we talked about before how Lulex and Kasing probably had the best synergy, maybe aside from Yellowstar and Rainover in terms of map vision, but teams are catching up. And now it's H2K's turn to take a next step ahead and advance themselves. And Fnatic, they're constantly progressing, but H2K, it feels like they got very stagnant.
We have to see. I mean, now they've realized there were mistakes. 2 weeks where they went 0-2. Giants now, if they beat them, they should have enough distance to at least secure top 3 spot.
Yes, indeed. And with that, we head straight into picks and bans. You can see the last time that these guys met up, it was week number 4. There are the compositions. H2K, they were the ones on the blue side. That switches around as the first ban will be Rumble out against Odawamne.
So, Rumble is going to be a champion we will see banned very often now. The new buffs to Rylai and to Leandris are so effective on him. He was already a strong pick before. Now even more. So Odawamne, we know it's one of his main picks. Kasing, the other one with the Thresh, standard bans so far.
Yeah, super, super standard bans here. Kasing gets his Thresh turned out, so Godfrey loses the Morgana. Couple support bans. This
give or take
puts up the market value of an Alistar, though. Remember, Sivir is still up, but Giants say, okay, we're gonna get rid of the Sivir, so we might actually see an Alistar first pick from Giants if HUK end up banning out the other tier 1 champion right here in terms of Kalista, but we don't even know how high she ranks anymore in this meta.
And Giants is a team that has left Kalista open and not first picked it because they don't play around Adri, so it's not always they value getting him a pick. I think they were maybe aiming for the Ezreal, but now being banned away from H2K, so Pepinero will not get it, get his hands on that one, which I also think is stronger now, even after the Luna's Echo change with Runeglaive.
If you're Giants here, are you looking for the Alistar?
Alistar or Kalista would be the obvious one, but Ryze is also open for Whirlip up in that top lane, so it depends. Do we want to value Godfrey now that he has lost two bans, also two picks in Thresh and Morgana? I think that's perfectly acceptable. I don't think you need to play around Archery with Kalista first pick.
In my opinion, though, picking Ryze into a team that has been notorious for their lane swaps, okay, maybe the last few weeks not so great, it is still a bold move, and we have to see what it is off.
It is, but Ryze, yes, Rod of Ages lost a bit of HP in the start, but the scaling is just even better now than before. So Ryze is
the new Archangel scales with more mana overall.
As well, like the build that gives the most AP in the late game is going Rod of Ages and then going for the Archangels as the second, or well, stack it up obviously. And then fully stacked, you get like 800 plus AP with full build. That's going to be
yes,
for Ryze.
Stacked Rod of Ages, for people not aware, this gives around 100 AP right now. So it's the biggest single AP item outside of this Rabadon's Deathcap active. So definitely, definitely big.
One thing we haven't talked about as much when we went into detail on Lulex is he's, the last couple weeks, he has had jungle bans thrown at him for the first time. He'd had to go away from the Gragas Rek'Sai. That's not going to be the case this time. They'll get one either way. They don't have to take it, and the Alistar makes a lot of sense to try and deny it away from Godfrey. We'll have to see if Kalista's the choice, though, on top of it.
And I think this is where Giants are asking themselves whether they made a great mistake, because Alistar Kalista, or Kalistar, as we call it, is just a really strong bot lane, and Godfrey and Ahri and Audrey Rodder aren't the most proficient at raw 2v2ing, so they kind of like, either they take the 2v2 and likely lose it, or they have to initiate a lane swap with Ryze themselves, so I feel like they're digging themselves a bit of a grave right here.
Unless they have an answer. I mean, Tristana's been a great pick into Kalista even before the changes coming in here to Kalista now. I haven't seen Audrey play it though.
And the matchup is actually very interesting. Jat touched upon this in one of his casts over in NA, but the Tristana-Kalista matchup initially, as we go through these picks, hopefully they pick slow enough so I can tell this story, traditionally was Kalista wins the first two auto-attacks, then Tristana wins 3 through 6 or 7, and then eventually as you keep fighting longer and longer and longer, Kalista comes out of the top with the massive rend. However, by that time she's usually dead. Because of the nerf on Kalista, Tristana starts winning this matchup earlier, so that could be definitely a pick that we start seeing now and later in the drafts against the Kalista.
Especially also if you want to bait it for a first pick like Ryze. So basically saying, hey, you're going to first pick Kalista because it's left open, as we've seen so often. If you start having some of these counter picks ready, now that certain champs are getting nerfed more and more, it's another reason we might see less jungle bans, because Rek'Sai Gragas also been toned down over a few patches.
Yep. You know,
more picks become not as strong, but they get closer and closer.
Yep.
Yes, indeed. So the Giants Gaming locking in their jungler and also that support Nautilus. They're hiding their AD carry for now. They don't need to take it. H2K, however, are going to have to reveal a little bit here. Will they save Ryu's pick for last? That has been penchant for a lot of teams. And the Gragas is a no-brainer with the Rek'Sai off the table for Lulex.
Yeah.
Choices now. What does Oduwamne go for? His Rumble is gone. And now it looks like the Shen might be the choice.
This is such a heavy kite dive conversation, basically the opposite of kiting, obviously. You have the Alistar ulti, Gragas is a big tank to initiate, and of course the Shen ulti coming in. Also fantastic skirmish because you have the Kalista pick. We don't even know what's going to be locked in the mid lane for them, but H2K right now setting up for a lot of map pressure, and if you're stuck under your tower, you're never safe against this comp.
The one issue I could see here is that Ryu likes going for this 5th pick Jace, 5th pick Varus sometimes, you know, to get the poke mid laner in, but if you run that in this composition, you're leaning very heavy towards the AD side of things, so you might actually have to go for an AP mid laner. Now, there may be new possibilities, you know, with the new Liandry's, with the new Rylai's Crystal Scepter that we're not aware of. First, we're gonna wait for Giant's answer, and they don't have that problem because they have the Ryze in the top lane, and this facilitates or opens up carry AD carry in the mid lane with some poke of Pepinero.
Not a whole lot of disengage though coming in from Giant's.
I don't like
poke. Like, this is a very, very, very squishy composition if you look at the back line for Giants, and they're not really gonna protect each other too well either. on H2K side, you have Alistar, you have Gragas, you have Shen all diving in. What Ryu have done in the past is run like an Orianna if you needed a safe mage in the mid lane, put the ball on the Gragas or the Alistar to then try and one-shot one of these squishy targets from Giants, but you might want to run even more engage if you're H2K.
I would actually like a Karthus here. I think that could actually work if you can manage to survive the Jace lane. If you ask Froggen, he says yes.
Of course.
And in the mid laner, maybe not. But the squishy backline in these fights, you know, just one wall into a pylon with the new rallies on the Karthus. Now it's every Q slows for 40%. Previously, his Q, if he hit one target, obviously counts as a single target spell. If he had multiple, it was AoE. But with the new rallies Crystal Scepter, it's 40% slow on the one burst AoE hits. So that's big.
Okay. Went for a little bit more assassination potential. No Karthus, sadly, this time around. But it is a bit what we talked about, how HK could go for even more engage to get to these squishy targets in the back line. I don't feel like Giants will have enough protection, really, to stop Ryu if he gets a good start, if you have the Alistar thrown in there, or well, the Shen with the taunt. But at the same time, Giants are running triple threat with so much damage that if one of the carries gets left alone, that can be enough to turn the fight around for Giants.
Yeah, and H2K's extended siege isn't the strongest, so they have to pretty much flip the switch and dive. And this is what they actually used to do at the start of the season, 1-3-1. Oduwana pushes in his respective lane. Then we have Ryu moving out to the bot lane very quickly as a secondary split pusher. And then they all converge on the middle tower, and they straight up dive. And they have a breakable will. They have a super tanky Gragas that can, for the majority, can stack armor and they're just trying to assassinate the Ryze. That's one win condition here for H2K.
Well, for H2K, as they look to keep themselves safe in that third place spot. Both coaches shake hands, walk off the stage, get ready to set up for this match. This is going to be a big one, ladies and gents. I think absolutely. Now, with the picks and bans locked in, it's time to see if H2K can defend that spot against Giants Gaming.
I expected them to be like bomb free or barely bomb two playoffs.
The double kill for Wurlip and Candy Panda's all by himself. An ace for Giants Gaming.
Nos encantaría ganar a H2K porque nunca hemos ganado en la FC ni en el torneo de expansión.
The change that they made with Godfred, it's kind of like when I joined H2K. They seem more coordinated.
Es un rival que siempre ha ganado. Iremos como 6-0 perdiendo y ya es hora de ganarles.
And here we are onto the Rift, H2K versus Giants. If you guys at home want to keep on sending in your predictions about this one, you can always hit us up at LOL Esports is the place. Hashtag GIA win or hashtag H2K win. But for now, we're on the start and we see what looks like standard lanes out the gates.
I like how Kasing in the feature is saying he expected Giants to possibly be down the bottom, you know, not close to the playoff at least. And right now, Giants as a team is only 2 wins behind H2K. If they win this matchup, suddenly it gets very, very close between them. And it's just a surprise, but we gotta respect Giants for what they've been doing this split.
Now, what does H2K value more? Their standard lanes and getting Shen ahead as a split pusher and using, obviously, the strength of a Kalistar lane, or swapping it up and denying the Ryze? That is a possible question right here.
I feel like if you do standard lanes, you can, with your Gragas, try and shut down the Ryze and just have the 2v2 lane in that sense. Because Shen also performs so well in standard lanes.
Yep.
Not too well in lane swap himself. He's very relying on having a strong mid game where you use that ulti to obviously set up these tower dives and create these numbers advantages around the map.
If they can kill Wurlip and expend his flash, that's big. That's what you want to do. And you can do that because you have Taunt Flash, Body Slam Flash here. Endless possibilities.
And also Ryze with the new Rod of Ages. He lost 150 HP in the early game. That's pretty massive for a guy who needs to scale up anyway. Still strong at all stages. But he is a bit easier to take down if HK wants to focus it. We have to look for Lulex. We talked about him before. Mm-hmm. In losses, he's not performing too well for H2K. Now there's a tank with him. There's even potentially 2.5 with the Alistar to help him in these fights, even if they do 4 points.
And both of these teams have incredibly quick camp clears if they use the AoE to their advantage on the bot side. Obviously, Kalista Alistar is super quick on the other side. Giants playing a little bit passive. They save more HP doing it this way, but they could have sped that up a little more. So this could actually give the push to H2K if they get the extra creep here. Will be a very interesting bot lane.
Got all the creeps.
They got them all, though. So this is definitely an advantage for Giants. H2K may have missed an extra creep here. So the level 2 will hit on the third range creep here. So one, or the first one already, because they got all the creeps.
All
normally
three,
it's the third, third range creep.
H2K were the ones who missed one of the melee ones. They have to be a little bit careful now. And already engaging.
All traps
going
hit.
Going in, yeah. Godfrey got knocked back just a little bit. But Yarnin is the one who's being fired down. Another rocket Fling him on the backside, because Singh will take a little bit of extra damage in these. Reset back to it, but Giants ahead.
And this is so annoying for bot lanes, because A2K finished their camp quicker, but because the RNG kind of played into Giants' favor, Giants still had all those creeps alive. They leveled up on the first range creep. H2K visibly caught off guard here and gets pushed into the tower. Now Alistar's to spec defensively, heal, and then pulverize.
Basically just the minions for H2K decided there was one guy they hated on the other side and focused him down first, where Giants were more spread up, trying to spread the love. Ends up being a bit annoying for H2K, but for now, didn't have to use any summoners. Jungle-wise, Frederick is skipping his blue just to give the Rift Scuttle, because we just talked about this. H2K in standard lanes can try and shut down the Ryze. So him skipping a buff and getting the Rift Scuttle and trying to look for Lulex is simply to save Whirlip, who's already pushing so hard.
I think it's incredibly smart move here, because he can just dedicate himself to the top side of the map, either find Lulex there and contest him in that jungle, or in that fashion, just securing easy lane for Whirlip and Pepinero, because his bot lane is winning. However, Lulex shows up.
Whoa, whoa, whoa.
What's happening here, Audrey?
Audrey, whoa!
Are you okay?
I don't think so.
Kazinga splash queued and then somebody knocked him back.
Yeah, yeah, and then he saw Lulex coming, so didn't want to give over the assist. He probably has Lulex in his fantasy team or something. Decided to just run into the tower.
Wait, wouldn't you want Lulex to get it?
Yeah, actually, that's true.
If he has him on a fantasy team, I mean.
Guys, I'm going to be honest, I don't play much fantasy.
It's okay. It's not for everybody. You got to go back all the way to week four. We see these guys last minute up. This was actually, well, not actually, it was definitely a big win for H2K and Giants. They want to even that head-to-head.
Right.
Remember, they're still the ones further down the standings. They're far from safe here.
And this game here in week four, H2K win their prime when it came to lane swapping. They swapped on Giants. Giants came later, three guys to the lane, ended up losing two members, fell super far behind. It was one of the games we highlighted to show how good H2K were. This game here, standard lanes. Pepinero will get a blue buff. This was the one Frederick skipped before. But Giants now get standard lanes, so should be a lot closer game in that case, because H2K does not get that massive early lead from a swap.
I like doing that on junglers that don't require blue buffs, you know, taking that path that you described so well and then just skipping it and then get the level 4 blue buff. It's early enough for it to matter in the lane, and it's early enough so that the second blue buff still spawns within a respectable margin. And we're going to see what happens here. And this is the problem when you win against Kalistar, you start pushing them, so Kasing will Q flash, knock Audrey back, and at this point he knows Lulex is there, so he's trying to get to the wall to flash over to the left side, but then he realizes, hey, it's better to save my summoners.
Yeah.
This is honestly not that bad from Audrey, but you can't make that mistake into Alistar.
So the annoying thing, especially for Audrey, was the fact he didn't even have enough gold for pickaxe.
Yeah.
They managed to engage on him, he gets a second Dornes, and then he buys a mana potion. Meanwhile, on the side of Yana, he's gone back. Kalista has this very easy build path in the start. We mentioned how Blade of the Ruined King might be the first item very often now that the AD ratio has gone down a little bit for it. So it's very easy for him, just 800 gold, well, pick up some lifesteal, and then you have a heal from Alistar as well. You can take a lot of these short trades.
And as it started, really solid for this Giant's bot lane. I mean, Audrey going down there really negated a lot of the edge that they had, that Vamp Scepter is going to give the Kalista some serious power here in H2K. They've already built up this small gold lead. It's only 6 minutes in. Lulex is looking to extend that, but he's on a ward.
Oh, this might get turned around in the counter gang. I want to watch how this plays out. Yarn has to flash.
Very quickly. Godfrey now gets knocked back into the tower. He's going to tank a few shots, but Yarnin already a little bit low. Lulex coming around the side. There's a teleport. A flash from Audrey to move away. They've turned their attention to Godfrey. He's surely going to go down as they stack four members. H2K get another.
Top lane as well. TP was already used from Whirlip, so he could never join it. Giants were the ones. Engaging
at
first, and now this is so annoying for Atri. Like, poor guy, you just spend your money on a pickaxe. Now there's a fight in the bottom lane. You flash away. He can only afford boots. And he's been back to base twice now.
It was a good flash, though, because Lulex went for the body slam, and then at the end of the animation, flashed over. Obviously, Audrey said, I know you're going to do that. I will flash out myself. But Oduwamna coming in with his signature. Let's help the bot lane teleport, and then let my team help me get back into the game type of move. Because at level 6, he will get another teleport for free on that Stan United. So good opening from H2K so far.
And that is why a lot of teams, if there's a TP disadvantage, you try and avoid making a play on the other side of the map.
Yep.
But if you are Giants at the same time, they might have said, okay, Shen is only level 5. If he TPs away, we should be able to get a good lane, at least for the Ryze, to give him a bit of an advantage. The problem is you're sacrificing your AD carry, and you got multiple people who needs to scale up. Jinx sitting on these items at this point will do nothing.
I still want to go back to the drafting phase where Giants, they had the Ryze to their disposal. They had the Jace. You don't have to pick a low mobility because we're not using the world immobile anymore. Low mobility, AD carry on the Jinx that requires these resets to get around his fights. Simply pick a gap closer AD carry, and he will do it. Just go even in that lane against Kalista. She is a super strong laner, especially with the Alistar. There's no reason to contest that when you can just play chill.
You guys said this in the beginning, that Jinx pick was very questionable. Yes, it has a lot of explosive potential, but it just doesn't seem to be worse so far. The one death there, you've got one death on the side of Godfrey, who had to pretty much sacrifice himself after they were chasing him down. H2K's bot lane, they're the ones getting rolling very quick, and we said that this is what might happen.
Yeah, if you have three champions on your team that can turn into dynamite, you might find yourself getting it exploded into your face before you can even use it. That's what's happening to Audrey right now. Look at this, he has 39 to 65. Odwanma gets bullied, but he's used to that. He's still a level ahead of Whirlip, even though he teleported to the bottom.
Goes for the taunt, too. Whirlip, wow, that's a lot of damage coming out from Odwanma, looking to take
him
on solo for just a minute. Lulex is coming around the side. As long as he buys enough time, doesn't go down, but he might have overstepped his bounds. Odo, not quite dead just yet. And in comes the barrel, knocking Whirlip back into the rest of the minions here. Odwanma looking to finish him off himself, and he takes the kill up in the top lane. Number two for Odwanma.
Poor Whirlip, he's fighting 2 against 18 right now. All those minions helping in, and good resource management from Odwanma.
And just the bait.
Yeah, nice bait. 8 out of 8.
Run back, you're like, oh, I'm dying. Oh, I'm just gonna taunt him, I'm just gonna keep him again.
Beautiful acting. Oscar for Odwanma.
How's everyone talking about Ryu in the mid lane? The guy is not acting a whole lot normally. This is one of the things about a champion like Ahri, one of these assassins, with the new build path you can take for going like Morel and Omicron, is the fact you can get that extra tome in the early game. Before you get Morel and Omicron, you don't have to go for mana regen, which doesn't really add a whole lot for you in terms of kill pressure. So right now for him, he can be a little bit stronger, smooth out the build path. Gonna get that Morel after, and then we might see Ryu start looking to create some picks or just swap down to that bottom lane and put Janna in the mid lane.
And that kill on Whirlip is key because this is the point where Shen really shines. He has this mini early game spike. Once he picks up that extra magic resistance and HP, that allows him to just split push better into these magic mid laners. Ryu misses the blue buff. The crowd goes for a collective.
It is a sad day indeed.
But I just want to touch on that matchup. It's so hard for Whirlip to touch Odwanma right now. He has 2 kills, XP advantage, item advantage. Has a Spectre's Cowl, so he can't even trade anymore. And this puts the pressure on H2K's side.
If it's a pure one-on-one, if there's no other players on the map, Whirlip would be fine. The problem is there's multiple other players for H2K, and they will look to go to that top lane if there's a trade going on, because we just saw how Odwanma can taunt him and keep him in place. Then the Gragas can simply join in, as we saw from Lulex before. That was set up way in advance. Now, Dragon being started for H2K. They have the Shen ulti, TP for Whirlip as well, though.
And the objective control from this H2K composition, as Freddy goes choo-choo, is just so good. Because they have so much zoning potential, because you have to walk into a Shen, into an Alistar that has Fate's Call to always be pulled out. You have the Gragas and you have the Ren to execute these dragons and these barons, so it'll be incredibly hard for Giants to fish check.
This is such a sneaky dragon. Notice how the bottom lane for H2K were back in base. They weren't even there to help Lulex. Giants, if they knew this was going on, could have so easily just moved up and stopped him. But because there was no vision in the river, nobody spotted him, and he just sneaked the dragon for himself completely free.
Giants right now still showing some holes in their play, not realizing that H2K were able to grab that quick dragon. So all said and done, we're 11 minutes into the game. It's 3 kills to none. That first dragon in their pockets, they've got themselves almost 2,000 gold ahead. Giants have to act quickly.
But they never usually do. They
look
usually
at what,
wait
TP?
For... They have to scale up, Whirlip.
There we go, they've got Ryu.
Flash.
3 members in, he's not going anywhere. Whirlip will get a kill back on him. Lulex a little late to the party.
Instant ulti over Odwanma, but just not enough. 3 members destroying Ryu. He didn't realize Whirlip had TP, so he tried to just dash that way out, but then saw it was way too late. Instant meta. Pirate, you just said Giants had to do something. That's a good move.
That's a start. They got a tower on top of it. There we go. Closing that gold gap a little bit at a time.
And if you can do that against a Shen, kill him and make him expend Stand United, or kill his Stand United at target rather, then you put yourself at such an advantage, because you take one of his teleports away. One of the pressure points of a Shen is that you can never go for these 2v2 fights, so you need a numbers advantage to burn your target before Stand United lands. Giants, they close the gold gap. 1,000 remains.
There's a TP advantage now for H2K, and have a level 6 or 7 Alistar in the bottom lane. If they want to set up a dive against Atri, continue shutting him down, you have to Shen TP as well. And anyway, let's see here. Whirlip, surprise TP on a pink ward, so nobody has spotted him from H2K.
And once Ryu spots Whirlip, he knows he's either going to walk into a targeted snare, so he hopes that Frederick misplays, but obviously right-click, insta-knock-up. easy game, easy life, and gets a kill. Lulex is now sneaking in. He has to punish World because he just expended his flash. Obviously, this is a return play right here. Good read, and Odwano could go in for the taunt right here.
Look at Ryo as well. He's moving up, trying to join his team. Whirlib is out of mana. And
in comes the Fat Man. There's the barrel. Yeah. There's the taunt. Whirlib baited right into it, and they do punish that flash. Although it takes him a little while, Odwano will get kill number three.
Really good acting again from Odwano. Any other player could have taunted first and then let Lulex follow up, but he steps back. He gives zone forward for Whirlib to step into. Whirlib takes the bait, walks in close enough for a body slam. And this is the cost of the move that Giants made earlier.
We do see, however, how Giants, they started the game securing vision for this Ryze in the top lane, trying to make sure Whirlib was safe. They completely dropped the ball on that for the last 5-6 minutes. We can see here, pink ward from H2K in their bush here, so it's very easy for Lulex to move in and set up these ganks. Bot lane now, we talked about this TP play you could make, and then going for an archery, poor guy.
They are, Odwamne comes on in, the guy is here, he's there, he's everywhere, and he gets kill number four. Now they're looking to finish off Godfred, who's going to hook his way to a wall. In comes the Fates call, dodge away from the shock blast. They could finish this tower. Let Pepinero walk his way back.
There's been so much talk on Reddit about the current state of being an AD carry. Adri right now might want to go and make another post saying it's not very fun because he's getting absolutely destroyed. And whoa!
Pepinero too, they just chain these CCs like it's no one's business. And Ryu takes out Pepinero with the help of his team.
Yeah, and this goes back to the drafting board. You first pick the Ryze, but you give away Alistar, Kalista, and this is what you were talking about, Deficio. You said, yes, they set up the vision for Ryze, but because their bot lane starts losing this honestly incredibly hard matchup, then they have to shift their attention to the bot side, and this leaves the Ryze exposed. And honestly, Lulex, we were criticizing him a little bit of his play in losses, but so far he's been instrumental for this victory because he's moving to the right places at the right time and getting the ganks off.
I think the fact you have three low mobility lanes that can all be easily ganked because of the CC coming from H2K, Shenton, Charm, Alistar, even Fate's Call throwing him in, makes it so easy for Lulex and H2K just to pick targets and so hard for Giants to respond.
Giants, if they want to get away with this composition, they have to play with more respect. Because remember, they're playing double tier composition on a Ryze and a Jayce, that's scaling. Low mobility Jinx, as you said, you can do that, but then sacrifice some CS, play passive. They're not doing that.
And as a result, Audrey's found himself down not only those two kills, but a whole boatload of CS, 30 difference between Yharnam, who's still showing that Kalista can make some big plays, especially if you've got a strong team right behind her. Meanwhile, Giants have sent Whirlib down to the bottom with Godfred, hope to get the Jinx a little bit of farm in between mid and that bottom lane. Is actually moving down towards it. Still, there's a lot of H2K members in here. Kasing is going to get that knock up. Now Whirlib being targeted out. Yharnam, he's got the sword on. In comes the Shen. They're going to try to make this Whirlib taken down. Godfred, Audrey now. Audrey's just completely blown up. Courtesy of Ryu, the Jinx gets set even further behind.
That was such a risky play from Giants. Shen had ulti ready. You're trying to siege up that tower here. You weren't even in a proper position. H2K just sent down everyone. And they have so many ways of engaging onto you. Pepinero, only guy left in the mid lane.
Yeah, fool me once, shame on you. But fool me twice or three times, shame on me for Giants. Ring that bell. Shame, shame, shame. Pink pop from Pepinero.
Odo's getting real bad.
Run, Pepe,
I don't think
run.
Pepe can deal with him. Teleport coming in. Yes, he's going to turn some shock blasts. And now, with a Whirlib there, Odo's going to rethink his decisions. But H2K still firmly controlling this one with their moves. Giants reacting, but it just hasn't been enough to close the gap again.
Let's watch that play again here. We see Hyun. He has the liberty to play very far up. Whirlib almost permanently out of mana. Double knockup from Kasing. We still have Fates Call to pull him back if Yharnam needs to peel. Odwamne comes in. Watch Lulex on the left side of your screen. He's just peeling because Ryu is dueling Audrey. And at this point, Jinx just can't get away from this assassin. And I think this is why Ari could actually be a good pick
in
the scenario, because he has three really easy targets to get to. And you said it yourself in champs like Deficio. Nobody can really peel for them. There's no Janna to reset these fights.
And it's just too early for Giants to start grouping up because they are this far behind. They don't even have the proper damage to do it. And no protection. Too easy for H2K to kind of control the map in that sense. And just use either TP or the Stand United from Odwamne. Notice how often he's part of the bot lane. He also picked up 5 kills for himself. He's, by the way, the top laner, or sorry, the player, getting the most kills pre-15 minutes in the entire LCS. This game is helping.
Well, Kasing might be helping even further, but he is pulled back nice and quick. Oh, that was a dangerous check for just a moment, but he's fine.
If you're training a new support and you want to show him the ropes, you know, but be able to help him when he overreaches for steps out of bounds, just like Audrey is doing right now.
There's the chompers. There's the spirit rush. Audrey right back to the safety of his team, but not enough. Rio will finish him off. Pepinero gets knocked sideways, and now Godfred's on the run. Sends out the depth charge, but that doesn't have any damage. Godfred is going down. Odo Wamne picks up another kill. Two for none. Rage 2K.
Kasing has a K and S, capitalizes his name for a reason. Tried to steal that K, that kill right there with a pulverize. But as I was saying, yeah, if you're training a new support, pick Kalista. Anytime he overreaches, oversteps, pull him back with Fate's Call. This is why Kalista is such a good pick. And honestly, in my opinion, Giants made a mistake picking that Ryze early, trading it for the Alistar and the Kalista.
Again, it's something we've seen from Giants before, where they leave Kalista open and don't first pick it because they want to pick for the solo lane as often, Pepinero or Whirlwind, and it's not about archery. So yeah, it is super, super risky, and they've just been punished so hard from the get-go. H2K have done such a good job using the mass amount of CC and engage they're running to always just force these early fights on Giants.
And I just want to highlight 9 of the 10 kills that H2K have came out of the top lane and the bot lane. So Pepinero and Frederick are... Look at their teammates. Guys, come on. Just stop beating.
It's one of those games, isn't it?
Yep.
I had a couple of those myself. So, two dragons, H2K.
Who are you, by the way, Pyro? The guy feeding, or?
Usually the one who's feeding, okay. Yeah. I know that feel.
I'll be the one not feeding then.
Oh, well, we can do it next time. Giants, for the moment, they do need to stem this bleeding. They're down those two dragons. They're down a whole heaping helping of gold. But the towers have stayed relatively even. For now, H2K have really been more about catching these Giants out. They've been doing a great job of it, but they need to start converting to objectives more than just Drakes.
Remember, we've been in this position before where we've written off Giants and we said, hey, they made mistakes. But then Pepinero is playing a poke champion. At one point, Fnatic overstepped their boundaries. It can all turn very quickly in League of Legends.
However, whenever Pepinero's been able to do that, it's been on the likes of Ezreal, which scales so insanely well into late game where you just become almost that like single carry, that superhero. I don't feel like the same goes for Jace as much as an AP Ezreal, but yeah, okay.
Don't kill my vibe.
We have El Bandido as well.
This is very true.
A Baron.
There are wild cards on the side of Giants. However, there is a reason, going back to your Jace comment, there is a reason that of the poke champions, Jace is not quite as rocking that ridiculous win rate, the same as like a Varus is, for example. Of course, the Ezreal also being very valuable, that double threat even, because both Pepe and Audrey have both played it to good effect. So H2K did well in the draft, I think, and that's definitely helping them out so far this game.
Now, we've hit the 20-minute mark. H2K are now 5,000 gold up ahead. They're about to take another towers to make it 6K. This is where they start looking at controlling the map a little farther up than they have so far, and they want to base themselves around these objectives, these blue buffs, these barons. Their siege isn't the greatest, but their split push and objective control is.
Especially because Giants will not have any answers to someone like Ryu. He's also gone for Rylai's, the new and lovely item that we're going to see very, very often. So if you are a Jinx or whatever in a side lane, even a Jace, and you get caught by one spell, 40% slow, you're not going to get away. Ryu has so much built in, so many ways of catching you. So H2K can so easily set up the 1-3-1 and just have Lulex and Kasing hold hands, move to the side lane and say, oh, we want to dive that guy? Yeah, let's go kill him.
And they really have been utilizing their sideways extremely well. Giants have done this in some of their games, but H2K have just been the typical masters of it. Now, Audrey, there's the catch you're talking about! Finishes him off!
All Rylai's, by the way. That was all Rylai's.
The good thing about Rylai's Kiss Receptor, if you finish it first, hang on, don't flash!
Yep, and they go in for Whirlwind. He gets knocked away and actually has to burn his flash on top of it, but now they are looking for the dive. You said this is what they're able to do. They send the big barrel out to try and get away as Pepinero comes around the side, sends a shock blast, holding the face call. In comes Kasing. They take down the tower, and the real goal was on their mind there. They grab it, and they get out.
Unconventional mistake from Kasing. Messes up the combo. Doesn't really matter too much, because they still get the tower. To get back on the Rylai's point, if you finish it when you're ahead of your opponents, it's so much more valuable because you sacrifice some raw damage and AP stats, you know, for defensive things like health, but it allows you to duel so much better because you're still on one-shot AP levels, if that makes sense. And this showed right there with Ryu, he catches out.
Yeah.
Audrey, super easy.
We just have to remember now, though, with the changes and also all the ones against Sonar with the 100 AP from Rylai's and the fact that Death Cap cost more gold. So if you want to really create a massive amount of tempo, you want to keep spamming out items and keep getting stronger and stronger as fast as possible. Delaying the death cap is okay. It's like a third item for him because, again, it costs a bit more compared to before. But once Ryu gets that one, because you're 35% AP, it just becomes even stronger. Then you get a void stuff. And there are not really a whole lot Giants can do to avoid the damage from Ryu.
I really like building more slightly defensive items when you get ahead because it just gives you so much more wiggle room. if you do mess up, if you do overstep your boundaries. Building raw AP is nice to get those big crits and or those big numbers of blowing people up, but having a defensive option to just play a little more careless, I really like doing that one. Once you have a gold lead, like HDK have over Giants right here, 8,000 gold right now. No Infinity Edge just yet on Avi.
Kind of looks to try and catch Lilux, but he is a very big Gragas. He will get himself out of harm's way, and now the fight is on over the blue buff, or the red buff, I should say. Lilux still throwing the barrel out as Giants mobilize to defend against this one. The Shen pushing up in the top, however. He's got almost two teleports available if he needs them.
I really like what Giants is doing here, though. They're saying, we're not going to beat you one-on-one 2v2, so if we do get a chance...
Audrey!
We've seen that before.
Do you still like it?
Yet another.
I didn't like the recall. The other part, though, because Giants know the only way for him to come back in the game is on a 5-on-5 teamfight where HDK messes up and like goes super aggressive. There were no ulti for Odon in this case here to join in, at least with the Stand United. So that could have been a chance if HDK were greedy. Like, that's what HDK can, or sorry, Giants can do. Try and group if HDK gives you the chance. Hope that you can punish them in a teamfight. But again, it's so difficult.
Good tempered aggression from HDK so far, and this is their style. 1-3-1, Ryu in the side lane, Odwan in the other one. Once they push up, they pincer, they pinch the mid lane, force you off the tower. Because they do this controlled tempered aggression, HDK is now 12 kills ahead to the just one from Giants. And 11 of those kills are on three people. They're on Whirlip, Audrey, and Godfred.
This game is definitely starting to get out of hand for Giants Gaming. They being pushed every which way. Ryu drawing the attention of three Giants, sends a charm out, lands it onto Frederick. Now, meanwhile, waiting in the wings, spotted by the ward as they clear it away. Yarn and Kasing.
Just wait for
the squad.
Wait for the pressure in the top lane. Once Shen sees two people defending him because nobody can 1v1 him, he'll just look for the dive. HDK opt to not do that this time though because they just want to get their objective secure. They say, okay, third dragon, let's take it slow. We just control this game out. They might go for another play on inhibitor tower if they find that a little bit too hard. They can take up a pretty much free Baron right now.
Yeah, I mean, HDK, once you get so far ahead, the shotgun becomes very, very simple. It's like, what do you want to do? Oh, we
everything.
Do everything.
Anything
so like,
you want.
Let's go bait a Baron, fine, that's perfect. That's 1-3-1. And if Audrey stays to defend against the Shen, it's so easy for HDK just to dive the opposite side of the map and just have the Shen stand united, being like, we don't care that Audrey gets a few waves. We're going to take the tower and a few kills for them. So HDK setting up for another potential play with Kissing, and Ryu, of course, just being so, so strong.
Continue to push down on that bottom side. Whirlip trying to defend against both Lulex and Ryu. Gotta be careful though. That charm was a flying. So, still keeping to this bottom side of the map, but easily picked up their dragon for HDK. Gives them even more mobility. And it's gonna be even harder now for Giants to try and defend against this push. What can they really do to get themselves back into this game? That's the question.
Yeah, Infinity Edge finished at around 24 minutes into the game. Facing off against Blade of the Rune King, Rudans. The build we expect to see more now that Kalista's nerfed a little bit. On-hit effects, obviously, still scale very well, but just raw AD doesn't help you all that much. And Yharnam could go for a fight here. If he gets a Stand United on his back, he could go in and start triple procking those board procs and taking down the enemy team. However, Odwan there,
he's
about
to do tons of damage, I would say. With all that gold he's saved up, able to pick up his Trinity Force, and that's not something I expected to say today.
Well, I mean, it's
a conventional Shen.
Yeah, it's great if you are a split pusher anyway and you have such a good start for the one-on-one, also for potential tower pushing, which will happen for Odo Amne.
He did get that big.
However, I agree with Pyra. I wasn't expecting to see it at 25 minutes. Sunfire Cape, Spectre Scout, and a Triforce finished already. That's going to be tons of damage. And Death Cap.
Yeah.
Let's see how much AP he actually has.
528 AP. 26 minutes in. Audrey currently sits on 1500 HP. One-on-one, please.
We're getting to about that time where both these teams start eyeballing the Baron, but as you guys mentioned a bit earlier, at this point for HDK, it might just be free if they can secure themselves some vision. Still sending Odawamne on the bottom side. Whirlip's there to defend. You can see the rest of Giants aren't keen on letting this go quite so easily. Still not pushing up too far, and the Baron is started by HDK.
Just a simple play. You have the vision control around it. You have the rise in vision. You know if he's going to TP in. Remember, HDK is the one starting the fight, so they can always TP first.
Looking for Godfrey. Got stopped.
Ooh, almost got to safety, but not in time. One down. They go back to it again.
That was one snare. Whirlip walked up and stopped Odawamne, but obviously it wasn't enough. HDK can comfortably handle that 44. They should just rotate in the mid lane, start pushing up, and repeat the play. Orlamus is keeping Whirlip busy right now. Now he knows that he's actually aware. Rise is a snare. Let's not teleport in full vision.
the same. Speaking, we're still able to get one for none. Got to be careful to dodge those heavy shock blasts. One of them did take a big bite out of Yarnin's HP, and the Fates call, sending it onto Frederick. They should be able to take him down here, pinning, balling him around as Ryu takes a seventh kill. Audrey hiding in the bush, it'll all happen.
Yeah, Yarnin saying, Alistair, I choose you. Going in, Ryu is just zoning Audrey. Every time he's even close, Audrey has to step back because he's so afraid of getting a seventh death this game. And this Baron will go uncontested right here.
And again, it's just so tough for Giants. I mean, you gotta try and do something to stop this Baron, but you just keep face-checking into charms and so on. There's so many ways for them to start fight.
So many ways indeed. Now that they've picked up the Baron, they can go full hog wild onto Godfrey, on to Wurlib, looking now for Audrey. Ryu Spirit rushes his way over, and Audrey never stood a chance. Frederick and Pepe, the only ones up at the moment to try and keep H2K away from this base. They're in no position to do it just yet, though.
Zero dragons, two towers, one kill. We said if Giants can win this game, they can challenge H2K for third, but
they may not be able to get
the objectives. Honestly, couldn't be bigger today.
Very apparent as H2K march towards inhibitor number one. They've cracked the base open. Odo goes in, taunts onto Frederick. They got kills on their mind as they take the objectives. As dessert at this point, Ryu chugging away on this top side. They'll turn their attention that way. Every member of Giants is back up. H2K might have to back away for a short time, but they'll be back and in greater number.
And they got super minions coming as well. Once they return to the base, don't need a fourth dragon unless you want to play it very, very safe when you are H2K. And yeah, at this point, I mean, what a fantastic game from them. Very clear game plan from the start. Bot lane and top lane were easy targets to gain. We see the Baron again. Giants trying to stop it. But here for H2K again, there's so many ways of just diving onto them and they're just that far ahead. And Audrey, of course.
And it doesn't matter what you do when you're this far ahead because you can even make slight mistakes, misplays. Lulex went for the body slam flash, didn't connect with Pepe. Tried to knock him in, but yeah, knock him out of the fight. The remaining members will easily win this fight or in this skirmish. And now Giants, desperate times, call for very, very desperate measures.
Putting the death brush, Lulex wanders.
They can't even kill him.
Close.
They need to go for Killista.
They are going to go for Yarnin, and he will go down, loses that Baron buff. That's the start of something as Lulex throws a big barrel on himself. Charm not going to land, but H2K should be able to get out of here. It's a slow march, though. Go for the knockup. Look for Lulex. Into Rune Prison he goes. They will get two here. This could be the start of something.
Giants just tripled their kill count in that fight.
I really like the play though. Again, for Giants, they're trying to do what they can. They're like, okay, we expect you to go for this dragon because they're going to stop the recalls because Odin is still pushing. Two guys are going to stop him though. So very well played from Giants.
Pepe.
Pepinero though.
Yep, goes to the skies and goes back to Fountain. Ryu with yet another kill. A double onto Audrey, his 10th of the game. This guy is unstoppable.
And we're back looking at Odin. He didn't leave. He's lane, there's no reason to him. H2K. I mean, you got super minions. You won that last inhibitor. Second last inhibitor. Secure that one for yourself. You really want that dragon, go get it now. Otherwise, just leave it. You don't have to pick it up.
And Odoam actually never finished that Spectre's Cowl. He says, okay, a base amount of magic resistance is all I need. And then I will spec full armor. Because Jace, Jinx, and Rek'Sai mostly all attack damage based. And he even picks up a Thornmail with the Triforce. I doubt if there's any combination of two members on Giants that can even duel him at this point, to the point where they can kill him in a timely fashion.
Yeah, where H2K won't be able to do something
like kill the Nexus, on the map.
Yeah, as an example, maybe this dragon. Oh,
doesn't hit the dragon. Yeah. So it looks pretty, but it doesn't connect with dragons or any neutral monsters. You have to connect it on a champion and then have a splash AoE for the steal.
It's a Hail Mary in any case. Giants at this point are going to need several of those to get back into this one. 3-19, the gold gap has just been oh so wide for a long time now, and they struggle to just defend the most basic things. Two inhibitors down, one in the mid, one in the top side. H2K looking to lock this one out, make it nice in round three.
And we talked about this composition from H2K, very dive heavy, and this shows in the way Kasing is itemizing. He goes for the Righteous Glory, even though it was nerfed. Then he goes for the Talisman second, because all he needs to do is speed up his team, connect the CC, Taunt Flash from Odoamne, combo, Charm Flash, Body Slam Flash, all these offensive dives, just one of them needs to connect and these super squishy targets on Giants will just melt.
It just feels like so many things we looked at in champs, like being like, oh, this can be super risky, this comp can really dive so effectively. It's what decided the game for H2K. Giants will have to go back and look at that thing, Ban Fates, and then They might die as well.
If they even have a chance. Down goes Wurlib. Another pickoff. They take down. This time it's Frederick looking for Audrey. Ooh. He never has a chance again. Oh, big one from Ryu as Ono comes around the side. Godfrey all by himself gets him a triple. And Pepe has just given up on Fountain. This game is all over. 32 minutes in. And all they need to do is polish it off.
Such a strong performance. Oh,
got the charm flash. Got the charm. Pepe, no. All the way out. There's the ace. It cost him a cow, but they don't mind. Nexus turrets being fired down. H2K, 33 minutes into this game, will secure themselves a win and sole possession of that third place. Top three for this team.
And it's not about the cow. It's about the message. When you're at this point, right before playoffs, it is often good enough to sacrifice a couple of key members to just send that message to Pepinero. You are staying in fourth place. We're fighting for that bye. HGK, one step closer now towards Origin.
Yeah, and you just mentioned how Giants will stay in fourth place. It's so scary for them because there's so many teams around them in the standings trying to take that number four place. Playoff isn't even locked in for them yet. We have like Elements, Gambit, Rock, and so on. They're all trying to overtake Giants. And this loss here could turn out to be super important.
Yeah, if you're watching at home and you missed the opening of the show, go to LOL Esports, check out our standings because it is close. One or two wins, one slip up at the end of the season could mean happiness or complete stacked tears for some of these teams. And then this is the point of the season where they look back and they go like, ah,
that one game.
If we didn't let Frederick steal that Baron twice,
10,000 gold lead, wasn't it?
Yeah. It all comes down to these little things, and you can see Giants mulling this one over. They didn't really have much of a chance this game, though. I mean, you just have to flat out say it. They got stomped.
But this is it. At the same time, yes, it was a bit of a stomp, but this is an easy game to analyze. The game spells itself out from champs, like, and it's not like H2K did something super creative or super, like, non-textbook, which is good League of Legends, as they say.
Yeah, and then when you run a comp like Giants here, which is just so low mobility, so risky, it looks even worse once the snowballs start. Because nothing is going to stop it. You're just going to keep rolling, keep rolling, keep rolling. So H2K could just do whatever they want on the map, and full credit them for taking advantage of it as well.
Yeah, you definitely need some combat mechanics. Giants traditionally do get behind and then have those combat mechanics, like the Ezreal sometimes, or these, you know, cheeky little plays, but it wasn't enough. They were too far behind.
Yeah, they definitely picked themselves a little bit of a hole there. And as it stands, H2K, once again, this is another big
set up to take on Elements. Let's focus in on that matchup, starting off with the Copenhagen Wolves, currently sitting two games back from SK in the 10th place auto relegation spot. Honestly, Dire Straits, they need to do everything to take their destiny into their own hands, even though it's not completely up to them.
It is definitely the case. Even if the Wolves want to get out of that relegation zone, they need some of their opponents to lose their games. Wolves need to take down Elements, H2K, Rocket, and Giants, and then still hope for both Elements and SK to drop some games if they want to try look that way, SK rather. For the Wolves, it's been shaky. It's gone from bad to worse. We looked at some of the numbers last week. Even before the substitutions came in, the team was struggling. And now with the substitutions, they're struggling even more. So we need to see if some magic has happened on 5-13. Maybe Soren can come back to life.
Maybe he can. And while this isn't a 5-13 change specifically, one thing that we want to look at with this matchup specifically is the jungle matchup. Because there, the junglers on this, specifically Shook and Dexter, are particularly the best players right now on their teams when you look at it overall. At 85.2% kill participation for Shook, the highest of junglers. On the other side, Dexter for Elements, just under 80% himself. So the stats look good, but the problem with these stats is that it comes from the fact that both teams just aren't getting a lot of kills, and the ones they do are kind of spread out, and the junglers are just having to be everywhere in all of these small little fights, and that's why these stats kind of maybe look a little inflated considering the position these two teams are in. And one player we wanted to kind of look at specifically was Dexter and his performance in last week's games. And, you know, he did a pretty good job in the early game, and taking a look at exactly how he was in this.
Yeah, the one thing I also want to highlight with both of the junglers is how good they look despite the fact their teams continuously lose games. Dexter has got a giant backpack that Elements are weighing down multiple times this split, and Shook, despite returning to the stage, is actually showing up again and again. This is just from a montage of Dexter once again showing up before 15 minutes. His stats are absolutely through the roof and doing phenomenal. And for Elements, I called them out earlier today in the Twitter question, which team is going to sneak into playoffs? I think it's going to be Elements. They play Copenhagen Wolves today. They will also be playing SK next week. And then they have to take down Fnatic or Gambit. Elements, I believe, are more in control of their own destiny because of the strength of schedule, because of how close they are to that sixth place position. They can look to improve on seventh from spring.
Yeah, that could be a good bet, actually, if we look at that schedule. We talked about Dexter. Dexter was also one of the guys who looked very sad last week after Elements losing and takes it very much to heart. Another guy we're always talking about is Froggen. And I'd like to have a little bit of a discussion about him because we're quite harsh on him because it is, of course, he is at the center of those team, at that team. If we look at his stats and the resources he gets, he is second in team gold share for mids, meaning that he's the second highest in the amount of gold that goes to him that comes into the team, but he's only ninth for team damage amongst mids, which makes me question maybe his influence. And it is even more interesting because the coaches we had here, Yamato and Sean, said he is very underrated. He is a metronome for that team, but if you look at those stats, maybe that's not completely up to
right. And one of the problems here is if the metronome doesn't, well, for Froggen in the middle lane, you know, if he doesn't get rolling until later into the game, then all of that gold stacked up, if you lose the game early, then you're just sat on gold on champions that items kind of don't really reflect in the damage stats early on. It's an interesting one. We know he sometimes likes these scalers. That could be somewhat of the contribution to that. It's a weird one. Certainly, though, when Froggen is on form on an early game jungler, it looks like a completely
on an early game jungler.
Mid lane.
A metronome cannot swing without foundations to hold it up.
True.
Wow. True. So much wisdom. Yeah, I feel a black and white zoom in coming in for that one. Now the teams are set up on stage, so we're going to check in with the casters for picks and bans.
Thank you, guys. Before we load into Champ Select, let's take a look at our starting lineups here. For the Wolves, of course, it's going to be in the top lane. Lenny, Shook in the jungle. Mid lane is Sorin. Freeze the AD carry. The support is Jesuit Cast. And their coach, Dentist. And this team, some dire straits for them. They'll be facing down Elements. On the other side, it is JWoww, Dexter, Froggen, Tabs, Niff, and their coach, Martin Mogensen. So for this team, for Elements, I think they said it best on the desk. They can, of the teams that are in that middle, lower side of the bracket, they control their destiny fairly well. The teams they've got going forwards in this are, you know, aside from the Wolves, Fnatic, tough game. But Gambit and SK, very winnable.
I wouldn't call Gambit very winnable, but in relative to the standings, they definitely have matches that they can win. And some of the, I actually do a cue with Dexter a little bit. He's like, yeah, we actually have a good shot at beating Fnatic. I still have to see if that's true, but that could be the upset they need. But then again, that
just gotta show us.
Counts for every team this week. So
we'll get ahead of ourselves.
But first, they need to make a statement to Wolves. They need a quick, clean victory. They can't let the Wolves come back because the Wolves recently, they've been looking worse than before their roster swap. Honestly, they've been losing more gold at 10, more gold at 20. Kasa and Lenny, they're getting that LCS experience, but they're sacrificing a whole lot for the Copenhagen Wolves as a team for that because they're not performing up to standards.
Yeah, and for them, it may very well be too late to see if they're able to survive. If they can pull out a win against all odds against Elements today, would definitely send a statement their way. But as it stands, in the picks and bans here, we've got some questions that need answering. So Vladimir, banned away, and so is the Evelynn.
This is actually an interesting development in terms of jungle pools. Usually we saw Rek'Sai and Gragas get hit and then people resort to off-meta junglers like Evelynn, like Nidalee, but Copenhagen Wolves, they say, hey, Dexter, you're Evelynn, played it twice last week, let's ban it out, put you back on the conventional Gragas and the Rek'Sai. Elements respond with Shook, you're a notorious Nidalee player at times, so we banned that one out instead, and we just force you on predictable champions. Sivir gets banned out like she should. Kalista obviously picked up force for Copenhagen Wolves. They have to rely on Freeze to carry, but slightly nerfed. Kalista could actually see a Tristana from Tabs. He is a player that could actually play that champion pretty well. A tribute to the past from JWoww.
Yeah, I think you're definitely right on the money with that one. And you know, speaking of the past, if there's any team that knows Shook and knows how to shut him down, it will be Elements.
At the same time, if there's any jungler that knows Froggen,
that's true.
It should be Shook.
See what he decides to take here. The Rek'Sai locked in for Dexter and Niff on that Thresh. The Kalista Thresh yo-yo lane will not happen this game. The Wolves, as the timer ticks over to them, what are they going to take? The Gragas should be a no-brainer for Shook, but then again, he has gone for some wackier stuff as well.
Yeah, he chose to play Rengar when some other picks were open in the past already, so could go for, oh, looks like he's going for the Lee Sin. Copenhagen Wolves playing the Morgana Kalista, incredibly safe lane. In addition to being double ranged, having the binding, you have the Black Shield. Just keep your carry alive. I like the Rek'Sai pickup for a team. that is playing against a weaker strategic team, because the massive map mobility that the Rek'Sai brings to the table should be enough to out-rotate, and that's what Elements need to look at. They don't need to beat the Wolves in sheer individual skill, in my opinion. I would rather see them take the approach of holistically outplaying than macro play, because that's what they need to bring to the table against teams that they simply can't outplay individually. Yes, if they win by raw mechanics, it will not learn them or teach them anything for the remaining games coming up, especially against Fnatic.
Very true indeed. So, they've gone ahead and taken the Rumble and the Corki. So these are also some fairly safe choices, but we don't know what the top lane is necessarily for Lenny. However, in his first couple weeks in the LCS, we haven't seen anything particularly big out of the Copenhagen Wolves' new top.
Yeah, and it's very hard for Lenny to find an opening here, because I don't believe Shen actually plays too well into the Rumble. And the new Rumble, the new build should work well. However, Elements is telegraphing their fifth pick in the mid lane here, likely because they want some AD damage. So they have an AP top laner, a hybrid mixed AD carry. So they definitely want like a Jace or a Varus in the mid lane, else they're going pretty heavy on the Magic side of things. And Copenhagen Wolves going back to their roots, Azeron Soren, he could definitely play that champion. And it does look like the Shen matchup will come out, so I want to see if Elements is going to take that. On paper, they're better off lane swapping already, even without seeing what Froggen picks here in that last pick, which it turns out to be that Varus. They want to lane swap, in my opinion. Rumble performs so well on low resources. You want to keep that Shen down so he can't teleport across the map. You don't want to give Kalista Morgana a laning phase. Thresh Corki has an okay lane, but definitely loses it. And Corki in a solo lane top is what you want. Get that early power spike to level 6, hit Triforce, and then start grouping around the map.
And it works well with synergizing with that Rumble. On top of it, they'll also have some quality poke here, not just the Corki, the Varus, as you said.
Yep.
It does go locked in for Froggen. And we'll see how that mid lane matchup goes. It will be a tough one for Soren. He's going to have to get right up and close and personal to Froggen to make a difference.
Yeah, now last week we saw Tabs with questionable positioning at times, some very aggressive flashes that sometimes worked out, sometimes didn't on the Twitch. This time he has a gap closer built in into that Corki, and he has another Lantern on demand from Nif coming out here. Honestly, I like Elements' draft. I think it fits the meta well. I think the damage is distributed evenly. They have 1.5 AD damage in the Varus and the Corki, 1.5 magic damage in the Rumble and the Corki then again. So, well, even spaced out draft, and then they have a frontline with the Thresh and the Rek'Sai. So good spaced draft. The Wolves, they'll need to snowball. Shook will need to find one of those key opening first plots that he always gets for the Wolves, and then they need to see, have they improved their shot calling? Because it was dire last week.
Yes, it was. Very, very dire indeed. But it's a new game. It's a new week. Why don't you guys tell us what you think about it? Hashtag CW win or hashtag EL win. Will the Wolves avoid themselves to be in the relegation spot, or will Elements be the ones who move themselves closer to the playoffs? On to find out as we're loading up right now onto the Rift.
So TLDR, if you zoned out during Champ Select, Elements want to lane swap for a multitude of reasons. Copenhagen Wolves don't want to. They want the standard lanes. Eventually, they want the pressure on the Kalista side. They want her freeze to start snowballing on that champion. Still very strong. A minor nerf. But it wouldn't affect this matchup all too much, in my opinion.
So far, we've seen a lot of that Kalista since we've started it. But now, as level one unfolds, let's go ahead and hear from Tabs how it's not easy going up against an opponent that's got nothing left to lose.
There's a lot of pressure that on playing against like the bottom team. So it actually gives you even a bit of an advantage. Like you have like the mental game over them because they're so pressured to have to win against you. Whereas you're pretty much lost anyway. You can't really do much about it. So you have a lot more freedom to try out crazy things.
Oh, sorry, gotta cut you off there, Tabs, as Nif wandered too close to the action.
Where's the heal
comes out. No ignite and no kill.
If Kass ignited, that's 1-2 ticks, then the next damage proc from Lee Sin Q would have done more damage. He would have been reduced in half. The map checks out, I just ran it in my head. Nif would have been dead. Big mistake by the Wolves. I mean, it doesn't get easier than this. He face checks you. You can even hold that binding a quarter of a second longer because he'll face check, then get damaged and be like, what the hell is going on? And Wolves, we should have taken the first one.
Missed a golden opportunity, just barely. As it stands,
all right, Kass, let's
use that one heal though.
For me, he has the exact cooldown of Ignite. It's 189 seconds. So in the next 3 minutes, he has to use that Ignite to get a big kill that is worth more than the potential first blood he could have gotten now.
Mm-hmm. These guys last met in week number 3, by the way. And remember, this is one of the Wolves' few wins. They managed to take down Elements. It was a very quick game, just about 26 minutes. It's a very different Wolves than we saw from that last time, and I would like to think of very different elements as well. As the lane swap, you did so accurately predict is coming into play here.
Yeah, Elements take the camp. Lenny is early in the lane. This is the way SK used to like to play the laning phases. It doesn't work out well because it sets you up for an easy 4v0 dive. Because the Wolves, okay, they're caught off guard. They didn't expect the lane swap for whatever reason. They don't have the double jungle to take countermeasures. Lenny is behind right now. He's zoned. He'll have to start a camp. Let's see how quickly Dexter and JWoww are going to move over and what's going to happen on the bottom side of the map. So definitely advantage already from Elements because they caught Lenny by surprise. And he's wandering around alone in his weak jungle.
Just out by JWoww. Just a moment. A couple of harpoons come out that way. Blue buff. Now going over to Dexter and JWoww, but it's a slow one, and if Lenny gets some backup anytime soon, it probably isn't going to happen as Kass and Shook are way down on this bottom side, and Soren's not interested in coming. It's going to go over to Dexter.
So both these teams are going to do the exact same thing. Lenny could go for a bit of a gank in the mid lane, but he's level one, walking all the way from top to bot. No double jungling. So if after this lane swap, the lanes even out again, JWoww will have a full level and a half advantage, if not more. And this is the traditional style that we see over in North America as well. Three people push this tower. It's no longer 4v0. They just send the Dexter back to the jungle to do jungle on his own side. Usually they switch up the sides. Jungle goes back to the safer side of things. But they have full vision of where the Wolves are. Only Shook is missing. He's doing the same thing, but there's an experience discrepancy right now. A very big one. Shook is slightly ahead probably of Dexter, but Lenny is super far behind.
And we did mention that. Now, one of the keys of this game for Elements is keeping that Shen from getting ahead. We saw what could happen so well when HUK's Odoamne was able to do the same thing to Lenny here, or same thing rather, to his opposing team.
Yeah, and this is what you want to do if your top laner already gets ahead in the initial state of lane swap. You want to bounce that wave back, whereas previously, AD carries were taking that wave afterwards. Now it's the top laners. JWoww has some map issues here.
He got it eventually.
Because the minions die, towers are harder to kill. If you wonder why that happens to you at home, when minions die, towers become harder to kill because when a minion enters the area of a tower, the tower drops in armor and it's way easier to take it down. Now that wasn't the case. JWoww almost had a very free trip to base. Let's look at Soren playing at Azir.
His win rate hasn't been the hugest. And you know, we've seen less and less Azirs as the poke has become more of the norm frogging on that Varus, his opponent, but Soren, now, I feel like this isn't just Azir that he's had a lot of these troubles on as well.
Yeah, but 40% is probably one of the higher win rates for him as
that's true.
All the way in the bottom of the table.
He's been able to do a little bit more on that champion than some others. And, you know, hopefully for the Wolves, they're hoping that that trend will continue here.
Now, Elements with a bit of an adaptation. Dexter is shadowing the top side of the map, facilitating that farm from JWoww. They just don't want him to get dove. So they're sending Nif over, and they're leaving Corki in the 1v1 in the bottom. This is what you like in lane swap. Corki is one of the carries that scales incredibly well with levels. Once they hit that level 6 for the rocket, later on the level 11, this phosphorus bomb scales so well. Corki is incredibly good at zoning a top laner that is behind two off the wave because he has that max range gap closer. He's level 4, Lenny's level 3. But I would have liked Elements to still send JWoww in this lane instead. Yes, Corki gets ahead, but Tabs is a little scared, no vision. So he's not bullying Lenny at all. Lenny's just getting a massive wave for himself, and this could spell some disaster for Elements. A poor strategic read. He's even allowed to freeze this lane, so unless Tabs is going to do something about it, Elements are losing their advantage.
Yeah, Wolves are looking for the top side while it's all happening as well. JWoww, Nip, and Dexter looking to defend this one, but you're right. Lenny's getting the solo XP. He's getting himself caught back up. He's actually beating JWoww in farm at the moment. There's no contest here, with only the Corki sitting just outside of range of the minions.
Yeah, and this is the game of experience in lane swaps. Yes, the gold is slightly ahead of the Wolves. Kass is only level 2, Nif level 4, so Elements funneling a lot of power in your support. Just going for a bit of a fight here.
Uh-oh, Tabs.
It's the wrong way, Tabs.
God. He's going to get taunted up. In comes Shook, the teleport, but it might be too late as JWoww flame spitters on. They just keep their attention turned to Tabs. The harpoon wasn't going to get intercepted, and that's first blood over to Lenny. Some even more experience falling right into his pocket, and Shook and Lenny should have enough power to take down JWoww, but Froggen is here, and he manages to get one. Revenge there for Elements.
Shook still has flash. Should have not died. Tabs should have not never gotten taunted and then flashed. He should have flash the taunt, so big misplays on both sides here, both strategically and mechanically. And if Elements want to, you know, crawl out of their bottom place position, they need to play better than they're doing right now.
Just gonna get bound under the tower. A few spears sticking out of him. Freeze and Kass are doing a fantastic job at keeping the pressure on against only the support now that Tabs has had to take a long trip up here. This game has kind of been turned on its head from what we thought at the very beginning.
Yeah, very peculiar lane swap. If after lane swap you turn out with your support being one of the higher levels in the game, normally you've done something wrong. If you watch games over in Korea, for example, if you watch SK Telecom, Wolf will very often be level 2 when Bang hits 6. Niff, he's level 5 when Taps is 5. So very, very different approach. That doesn't mean it's wrong, but it means it's worth investigating. And so far, what I've seen from Elements, I feel they've made a couple of mistakes in where they prioritize their members, their pressure. They had the advantage on Lenny, key matchup, but now he is 28 CS, 28 on JWoww. He is level 5, JWoww is level 5, so everything is even Stevens yet again.
For the Wolves, that's about as good as you can expect things. They've not had the greatest string of games, and by any means, you know, yes, they were able to take one off Elements the last time they met. Maybe they're the kryptonite for this team, but so far, anything, putting any wins on the board is going to be happy for them.
It was good, however, to see Frog and Rome. This is something he, in the past, was criticized for, always just defaulting to the Wraiths and the Wolves instead of leaving his mid lane to Rome. He's using that pressure from Varus into the Azir matchup to Rome down bot. Freeze is still locked down, so he's not carrying the Wolves just yet. He's waiting for some more farm. So far, Elements are still in control of this matchup, but Shooks, he needs to snowball, and he's the one that always has 100% or 90% kill participation in these matches. Now, JWoww still has his flash, so he has to respect his gank.
Meanwhile, though, JWoww might get baited a little bit forward. He's going to go up through the minions and kick JWoww back. Throws down the equalizer, try and cover his tracks. He's got the flash, he will use it, but so will Shook. Goes in, secures the kill. Dexter's too late. Goes in for the flash though, Queen's Wrath, and safe guard over Froggen's Lenny.
Froggen's coming.
Froggen's coming in. There's the arrow. Can it pierce? Looking for Shook. Not going to connect, but he's now going the wrong way. Going to run right into the waiting arms of Niff. The lantern blaze. Shook. This time, no flash. He goes down. A one for one yet again.
Good communication by Elements. Dexter's, he was aware that he could play super aggressively because he had the backup coming. However, JWoww still got off guard, and that was a relatively telegraphed gank because obviously you have to put yourself in the position of the enemy jungler. Is he going to go top lane? No. Corki and Thresh pushed out the lane. They were basing. No gank opportunity there. Is he going to go for the Varus? No, because he's completely controlling Soren, and there's a lot of wards around the mid lane. So where does he go next? Out of his own jungle or bot lane? JWoww found himself exposed on that side lane. Dexter was there, but a little bit too late. However, good roam again from Froggen. He is the cornerstone of Elements, traditionally, and especially this game.
And he will grab himself a well-earned blue buff. Thanks to the help of Dexter, 2-0, as he's been in the right place at the right time for Elements counteracts. Freeze and Jesuikas are going to polish off this tower up in the top. Should take them just a few moments more. They're actually going to take their time as the mini wave wasn't quite up in the range they need. But Elements, meanwhile, are looking to do the same on the bottom. And Lenny, without backup, is going to have to give this up.
Yeah, Tabs level 6. You have the CC from Nip. Extra damage. And Shen can always stand united to his teammates, but nobody can come to the Shen to help. So what you definitely have to do when you play against a double global, the teleport, and a stand united, is you just move towards that target because he can't get any help from his team. You get him down, then you move on to the teammates. And you ignore Freeze. You gave him Kalista, and this is... Elements is doing what Giants failed to do in the first game. They gave away Kalista, but they don't play it. They don't care about it. They just ignore it. They lane swap away from it, and they keep missing the lane. Say, okay, we don't play against this Kalista Freeze. Maybe a very strong champion, but we don't care. We just go for these objectives, this map control, and taking a dragon.
Yep, much earlier than they normally are, and that is because of the way they built this comp. Remember, we always were talking about Elements being the team that's all about the late game, all about the late game. That's changed for them. We're seeing some evolution. This composition especially, they want to group and fight, and they're going to need every buff they can get.
Yeah, Froggen definitely has to hold into his flash, because otherwise Soren can just sweep in for the Shurima shuffle.
Ooh. If he doesn't die first.
Yeah, this is Varus with a blue buff. Every couple seconds, arrow comes out. You have to dodge it. Take a look.
There's another hail. Oh, man. Yeah, Soren can't get anywhere near that right now. And he is going to have to preserve his blue buff by going back to base. Meanwhile, Froggen is going to be joined by Niff and Tabs as they look to polish off this mid tower. Kass is there to defend, but will he be enough? It doesn't look like it.
Yeah, and this is why you can never look at just CS alone or gold alone to see how well a game is going. Because Soren is only 3 CS down to Froggen. However, he yielded the pressure. He fell behind in lane. This superior wave clear from Froggen allows him to make this move first. Roam out, pick himself up 2 kills, and even out the side lanes that were losing and being pressured. So yes, you have even CS, but what does it matter if Froggen is just controlling the game entirely, still staying ahead of you.
Still pumping out that damage onto Cass. They get a hook onto Shook this time.
Black Shield.
Fram is going to get out of there. Nif is caught up by the binding, takes some damage, but the tower is still incredibly low. Another mini wave, and they might be able to do it.
Elements with a textbook extended siege composition, double poke, one of each kind. Dexter, however,
goes a little bit deep here. Black. Freeze and Cass, he's trying to juke away from them, but he goes down immediately. Teleport comes a bit late. As Froggen will manage to equalize a kill, but a jungler for support is a poor trade.
Yeah, a bit of a poor mistake from Dexter, overstepping his boundaries, but Elements can definitely lock back in, take the tower.
Equalizer, double flay, into the box! Now Lenny and Soren might be in some trouble. The soldier's gonna cover him for just a minute, but Elements, they were looking for blood.
Where the lane swap was lacking, hitting the power spikes, Elements is doing very well. Level 9 Froggen, level 7 Tabs. Even without the Triforce or the Muramana, they just realize that their composition is so much better. They can group up on these towers and see the forward zone control so much. These arrows coming out, rockets coming out, hooks coming out. With the security blanket that is the equalizer if the Wolves choose to engage. So Elements playing through their strength. They're only 500 gold ahead, but they control the tempo of this match.
They have all the pressure on their side. Froggen at the forefront of it. 100% kill participation, 100% kill share. Got to be careful to avoid the binding potential from Cass, who gets spooked and runs backwards. But at the moment, Elements are holding all the cards, giving up little mistakes after they made just a couple in the very early game.
You know, Elements, they're stabilizing. They have one guy on the top lane, one on the bot lane, so they don't want to make any plays in the mid lane. They've got that middle tower. They've got all three tier one towers, so now they need to start manipulating the waves. Get as much farm as you can and safely. Force the Wolves to overextend in these, what they call, very long lanes. However, Tabs find himself overextended a little bit. Yep. You have the Shen delivery system.
And in he goes. There's going to be Tabs trying to get out with a Valkyrie, but way too late. Four Wolves collapse on him. You know they travel in packs. Why were you that deep?
I feel like Tabs should have just Valkyrie defensively, because that would at least block an offensive flash from Cass. Whenever you do that as Morgana, you wait for the Valk, then you flash afterwards because you don't want to break your tether, but you have to predict Corki's flash. So Tabs could have either Valk flashed, tried to get out, like it couldn't, or Valked and faked the Valk flash, in a sense. And then at least Cass would have dropped a summoner there. Instead, he just dies. Yeah, overextending, not using his summoners correctly, not playing the mind games. Tabs 0-2 and 2, and this is not the Tabs that we saw last year over in Alliance.
Definitely not. He has been having a rougher time of late, but Elements, fortunately, do have some other weapons, and Froggen pointing a big one right there towards the mid will actually store it for just a second. Dexter, JWoww coming around the side. They are starting to group up a little bit. It's 2 minutes out to this next dragon, though. Still gets some pressure.
Doesn't even need to fire his bow anymore. It just shows how big his arrow just is. The Wolves cower in fear. Because it's starting to hurt right now. Brutalizer finished up. Cooldown boots finished up. This is what Varus wants to do. Obviously, stack that CDR. Arrow after arrow after arrow is what Froggen is looking for. They used to call it the Legolas build when you went BT first. I'll be stacking that tier. Waiting for that mid-game power spike on the Muramana. Try to time it with the Triforce. And then Siege.
Continually keep the Wolves out of contesting really anything. Skullcrab control has gone the Wolves' way, however. And with the Dragon just about a minute away, Copenhagen Wolves are going to look to try and take another one away from Elements, get themselves a few stats, and be competitive where this mid-game spike that Elements are controlling right now. See if they can fight against it.
And where support experience was a metric to judge how well a lane swap goes, I think, or in my opinion at least, CS of top laners, if it's even, is also a metric. Both of these guys are very low on CS compared to the mid laners and the carries, which means they're afraid of going to the side lanes, they don't feel they have the necessary vision and pressure, which makes for a very small map. Everybody's grouping around each other. They don't have the liberty to farm these side lanes. JWoww is sitting on 70 CS, rushing Liandry's. This is very interesting. No, not a double magic penetration build. Just straight up building that Liandry's now that it has more base AP and good proof for an early power spike. I would argue boots, you might want to get them.
Especially if your teleport's not available yet. You might need to be running pretty soon. That dragon is pretty close to spawning. We'll have to see with these new changes coming in on patch 35.13. See if that ends up being a good work fit for JWoww, but I agree, not having that boots is definitely going to be a bit of a risk. You see him taking a very slow march down towards this dragon pit. Some vision in the back, it's gonna get started by Nif and Dexter. There are a few wolves waiting in the wings, however.
No vision for the wolves, though. They get the crying orb. Scrying Orb rather. Find elements, but what are they gonna do? They're not poised offensively and they're not cross-mapping either. This is the sign of a team that's behind strategically. If you have to watch your opponent do the dragon and then go for this RNG steal almost, instead of cross-mapping, you know. When a team is doing dragon, they commit to one area. If you predict that, you can move around the map. Why don't you go into elements of red jungle, double ward that up, you know, facilitate a push, rotate in the top lane, try and pick somebody else. So many options. Instead, the wolves, they sit back. They watch elements take a dragon, nothing happens. The game stays even.
We've talked in the past about this iteration of the wolves' coordination issues. And it just seems like they're also lacking in that foresight. Elements, as a result, they still make some mistakes, but they have been able to control this game thus far. Two dragons at the 18-minute mark. Slight gold lead for them, and then a slight tower differential. All they need to do is keep controlling the sidewaves and keep the wolves howling at their heels.
Yeah, let's take a look at the builds, Pyra. Standard Blade of the Ruined King finished on freeze. He found himself two kills so far, though, so he could definitely step up in the carry position. Morella and Omicom still finished up on the Azir once at CDR. Spam those soldiers. Shook is getting tanky. He's a main initiation tool, which you could do in these compositions. Poke is very weak to flanks and hard engage. It's incredibly hard mechanically to pull it off. However, Shook has shown that he mastered the insect. He just needs to find those flanks. The flanking is easy if you have vision, but this is where the synergy between Shook and Kass, even though they speak the same language, is still pretty non-existent, and you need to work together with your support if you want to facilitate that vision.
It's very important. This is something the Wolves will certainly have to develop very, very soon if they want to keep themselves in the LCS as it stands, still sitting at that bottom of the table. I want to say everyone counts. It's pretty much true of just about every single team as Shook narrowly eats an arrow there. It especially means a lot for the Wolves because they need to keep themselves out of that auto relegation zone.
Exactly. And while we are fair in critiquing the Wolves, however, this game, they're doing better than usual. Mm-hmm. They are down 1.6k, 1.7k gold, and if this stays the same until the 20-minute mark, traditionally, they are down 5.2k, so 5,200 gold. That means game over. They still have a fighting chance right now. So this is progression from the Wolves, some synergy in the lineup. Step one is taken, but there's a whole lot of steps left for them to take.
And for Elements, at this point, Trinity Forest power spike, you've got the last Whisper finished up for Froggen. There is a time that they can fight. Let's see if they decide to opt for it. There is still a very slim gold lead ahead, but they're playing it very, very carefully so far.
Yeah, and Dexter needs the assistance of Nip, honestly. They need to start controlling vision, because if you look at what's on the table for Elements right now, all the Tier 1 towers are gone. This is where traditionally you can force the Wolves to group and poke them out, get an advantage. The Wolves are not going to group. That means you have to go for Tier 2 towers. If you want to do that, you need deeper vision. Your support and your jungler need to be a buddy system right now, because you can leave Corki alone to wave clear from far away. Nip doesn't need to be here. You should be counter pressure somewhere else. Imagine if Nip was right now with Dexter. They could dive the mid lane, zone out Soren, and have more wave clear on their side than their opponents do. Instead, they're just defensively reacting to what the Wolves are doing. They're a step behind instead of being a step ahead.
Despite having that lead, yes, they're not throwing their weight around too much. The Wolves, as a result, have an opportunity to try to get closer and even things out further. Soren, this time, sidestepping away from the piercing arrow. Shook now waiting in the brush to see if anyone checks into it. He will spot Dexter, who places a ward of his own in that river brush. A real Elements, very slow to push this one in. They'll take down the Azir turret in the middle.
Azir the Builder, build your own base, one turret at a time. Buys himself some time, that's all Soren needs to do. He's on the back foot. Traditionally, this is where the Wolves are. Elements are not showing that they can exploit that. They're going for the even lanes, dragging out the game until they're tanky enough, I guess, to start a Baron bait. That will be the likely logical position later in the game. They might set up for third dragon later on Baron, but it's too slow. I feel there are more options right now, especially when you watch these better macro level teams. Watch Fnatic games, HTK in their prime, watch other regions, watch SKT. Obviously, you can't always do what they do because they're just simply better at the game, but take some notes right there and see what they're doing that leads to success. And the number one key after getting these tier 1 towers is vision. Contest jungles, deep jungles, instead of doing your camps, go to the enemy's camps. Contest the race, deny that smite proc that lets you clear wards. Get to the wolves, deny that spirit that shows you where people are invading. Deny some buffs, make their jungle your own. This is step one to snowballing.
Well, they have placed a few wards down, but certainly hasn't been enough for them, and they're not really covering all of their bases here with Cass able to easily clear away a bit of vision of him, of his own. And with only tabs there to push him back in the bottom side, they can freely farm this one out. This is worrying as the Wolves, I mean, they have a Kalista, they have an Azir. These are two late game threats that, while Elements has this mid game power spike, they're not necessarily using it.
Yeah, Elements still have plenty damage late game too because they're running triple carry. Wolves could match that potentially. But the same thing goes for Kass. He's not grouping. He's been stuck in his bottom lane, helping Freeze farm. Essentially, leeching experience with these wards that he has built up right now. Freeze has triple defensive wards. He doesn't need his support to shadow him or help him. This could, Kass could easily roam into the mid lane, join up with Shook, get another deep ward, pressure out Frog and rotate to the red side. You know, extend these moves together in unison. However, they're hovering for this cheeky bind right here.
Narrowly avoids.
If Tabs is aware, that will never work. These are mechanical outplays. You're trying to outplay your opponents mechanically, but this is not what you need to do in this day and age. Season 2, yes, it works. A whole lot of seasons ahead.
Well, still playing a bit like they're behind. Just a couple seconds left on this next dragon. Elements will try to set up for it, but no vision there. As it respawns, even the Scuttlecrab is still scuttling around. Both teams seem to have forgotten about it. Elements, however, will be the ones to collapse and to force Copenhagen Wolves away, howling yet again. See if they are able to stick around and possibly pull off the steal.
We have to see a fight from the Wolves here, otherwise there's no reason for them to posture with so many members around this dragon. They have the opportunity to move around wherever they want. Elements, they recognize that this is happening. Send Froggen back to the mid for initial pressure. However, Wolves are yielding.
Give this one up. They send their bottom lane back to base. A little bit of extra help from Froggen sends a piercing arrow that way, and this time, Elements will secure that dragon for free.
Yeah, and then look at what Lenny is doing. He pushed up the top lane, but he's basing before it even hits the tower. So they donate a stacked wave to Elements. They don't cross map. There's no counter objectives. There's no pre-planning. If they timed the previous dragon, which they should, because they all stood around watching Elements take that dragon at 6 minutes. It's not that hard. I've done it before. Then you can orchestrate a play around Elements going for that third dragon and sneak into their jungle. And then when they rotate back into their own jungle, catch them off guard. This is what Giants was doing at the end of the last game. But no pre-planning, no shot calling.
No, they're really not able to come together and make these plays happen. And so while Elements is not playing it out perfectly, far from it, they're definitely still looking like the better team on this one. And the Wolves, they will have to find an answer sooner or later.
However,
they
want
to stay alive.
Since Kass and Lenny joined, this is the closest game it has been for the Copenhagen Wolves. And that's what they need to do, get experience. Talk about this last week as well. Kass and Lenny are new. You need to play these games, feel what it's like on the stage, and then go home and watch these games with their analysts, with their coach, and adapt and learn from their mistakes. And you can already see that they did that to an extent. A lot more timid on the Wolves. No crazy plays, getting caught off guard. Obviously, Elements is facilitating that with this traditional, very laid-back play. By no means are the Wolves out of this game.
No, indeed. They are getting themselves a little bit behind in the dragon game, but everything else is fairly even. It's only 2 towers to 3. Now that we're 25 minutes into this one, the Hurricane and Blade of the Rune King, of course, had been completed for the Kalista. Freeze has also got himself a Vamp Scepter on top of it. You can take a look in the mid, where Soren's now working his way towards a third item, the Needlessly Large Rod. A little cheaper, it's been downscaled on this patch. Builds into a lot more things.
In 25 minutes on the board, Baron is on the menu right now for Elements. That's where you want to be with a poke composition. If you can control the vision around an objective, not the objective, like you don't want to start the objective, but you want to give the illusion to the opposing team that you can. This forces a face check. When you see them coming, it's incredibly easy for very skilled mid laners like Froggen to land that poke, catch them off guard, send out that Varus ultimate, follow up with the equalizer, punish them for contesting these objectives. And that's what Elements is looking to do. They're obviously shown a very slow approach, so they'll be looking for dragon number 4, Baron number 1, bait the Wolves in, punish the face check, get a gold lead that way, slow and controlled, typical Element style.
They haven't changed in a while, they're certainly not going to start now. Elements definitely don't want to risk getting a loss here. The playoff picture is still incredibly close, especially with Giants losing that game. They're one of the teams still very much in the running, even if they're on the lower end of it.
And I was about to say that we see some synergy from Nif next there with the incredibly well-timed synchronized recall. One of the most beautiful things in League of Legends, sadly. Dexter opts out, sends Nif to the base. We'll still have to work on that just a little bit.
They almost had it.
They had a great start. They just need the progression.
Just be able to close things out. Speaking of, as they still stack heavily in this mid lane, a couple of Wolves have gone over to clear vision out of the Baron pit. Yep. This is a bit of an oversight from Elements. They didn't have to give that up.
Now, JWoww should, in my opinion, be already be heading down to the bot lane. Unless Elements wants to force a dive immediately on this mid lane tower, they have about 30 seconds to do it or a minute before Lenny's split push threat very obviously will become an issue. They're committing to this. We will likely see a fight here.
Elements still playing a little bit back. The flame spitter's on.
Oh, Lenny's flanking.
On to Soren. Lenny's coming around the back, not using his TP or his stand united. Shen might actually be a ninja here, but the tower is already gone. So it doesn't matter if they don't see him coming.
Yeah, and instead of trading that tower for pressure on the map, Lenny could have been way up in the bot lane right now. If he walks over and flanks, he leaves this team in a 4v5 anyways, long enough for them to take the tower. If you're gonna yield that tower pressure like that, just Lenny, just keep split pushing bottom. Hit on that tower, force JWoww back, and then use your double teleport advantage to make a play. Right now, the Wolves are grouping up underneath a turret against double poke. This is exactly what Elements want.
Goes to show that the Wolves still have a lot to learn here, especially their newer members. Freeze is coming to the rescue to clear out the waves, but five members of Elements still stacked on the top. They've got reinforcements, shook around the side, connects the Sonic Wave. Soren is also there. They will need a wombo of a combo to stop this, though.
And it's incredibly hard to flank against the Rek'Sai because she has Tremor Sense. And even if Lee Sin comes over, one knockup can ruin that combo. Dexter just playing zone, zone, zone. Hook goes wide. And Wolves could have gotten punished there. So they dodge potential punish, but there's no comeback mechanic unless Taunt flash into Shuima Shuffle. But Shook is looking for an opening, but Dexter will rarely unburrow unless he absolutely has to.
There's no need at this point. They just continue to chip away, and the Wolves yet again have to yield this pressure. Another dragon soon to come up. Elements are grabbing objectives just through sheer perseverance. The Wolves are giving it up.
And we just checked. Lenny has done 100 damage to champions in the last 9 minutes. He's been playing on an island. And what has he achieved? He has split pushed the waves correctly, but he stopped halfway. Job half done. Not a job well done. Look at that wave on the bottom. This is what Lenny started 2 minutes ago when I was talking about the split push. It finally hit that wave. JWoww says, thank you very much. I could farm these waves 6x6x6, but I prefer my minions come in 30 apiece.
Either way, he gets them.
Gets him.
And yes,
and he pushes that out. He pushes that out again. He will initiate another slow push.
They're gonna go
the Wolves are going for Baron.
Very quick desperation move. This will prompt Elements into action. Teleport pretty far out. Kass a little bit low. Nif gonna send a hook. Lands on Freeze, but he's got the spell shield on. Shook goes in. Equalizer is gonna burn him down. It's Froggen who actually gets the kill credit. And Kass goes down. Lenny, Soren, Freeze all on the back, running away. Nif can't connect a hook. Lenny flashes the wall, but he's out of the fight. Emperor's Divide, Elements will get no more kills, but they easily stop that Baron, and they can start it off themselves.
Yeah, and you were right, calling it a desperation Baron is exactly what it was for the Wolves. Because they ran out of options, they had no split push going, no alternative. They wanted to catch Elements sleeping, maybe one or two members were in base. JWoww obviously still has teleport available.
Opens up quite a lot, Elements. Make a big counterplay, ping out for Dragon number 4, should be able to lock it all up. They've got wave pressure in the bottom, about even the top, about the same. Once they've got that though, they can go right back to 1-3-1. It will be a hell of a lot more effective with that Baron buff on for the next 3 minutes.
Yeah, they could do whatever they want, 1-3-1. Honestly, I prefer Elements right now. Having no teleport or flash on JWoww, I would just opt for a 5v0, perhaps 4-4-1. I don't think splitting up your members all that useful. Shook might go in here though.
Looking for it, see if they can secure it. Not going to be able to take away the dragon. Secured by Dexter. Fight is on. Kass pulled back. Chains of Corruption onto Lenny. See if they can finish him off. Kass gets thrown back in, only to be burned down and shot through the heart by Froggen. In comes Dexter. Looks for Lenny. He goes in. He goes down. That's a kill to Tabs. 2 for none. Froggen might be blinking, but Elements have got Wolves already on the back foot. Another kill with an equalizer, and Soren is out of the picture.
That equalizer was just straight up dirty. Elements doing their fourth dragon, forcing the Wolves to come in. Shook couldn't get the steal. Dexter outsmited him. And we talked about this in the opening on the analyst test. Shook versus Dexter. That was the matchup we were going to match, or watch rather. And Dexter reigns supreme.
Came out ahead. The mechanical outplays.
Let's watch this again. Look at. Don't look at anything in particular, but just look at the zone control from Elements. The Wolves have to walk into that arrow right there. Kass, ulti, gets pulled out. And Varasalti comes in. Kaz goes back into knockup frog and only to sacrifice himself. No engaged in unison. Lenny says, okay guys, I have a taunt, let's use it. But Dexter is zoning the back line. He just gets knocked in and there's... Ah. The Wolves are not working as a team here. They find themselves into situations that they then want to play themselves out mechanically, but there is no foresight, there is no planning, no shot calling. This is why they're dead last in the league right now, and as the window is closing, the light's shutting out, Wolves are locked in for auto relegation.
Starting to look that way, time running out for them. These elements look to try and push in this one, still with the Baron buff on, with four dragons. Doesn't look like a whole lot can stop them at the moment. The Baron-empowered minions are marching forward. Soren, Shook, Kass, Lenny, Freeze, they're all here. But can they really stop it? Soren goes in, tries to shuffle, only succeeds in absolutely nothing. And Soren on the front after Izanya's burned away. A valiant attempt ends in disaster, and Elements can just wait for another mini wave, or not.
The entire Elements squad is showing how easy it is to land skill shots, stationary golden target. Bit of a waste, but don't really need it. Elements now looking to close out that first Nexus Tower, not Nexus Tower, Inhibitor Tower. 33 minutes into the game. Very slow. Slow and steady is the race, they say.
And haven't given up too much for it either. Two towers on the game so far, four kills. Nif goes forward, immediately point blank hook onto the Shen. Dexter steps a little forward, out of bounds. Freeze punishes him for it, but nonetheless, right back to his team. Easy inhibitor take. They just don't have the punishing power, and the Wolves continue to be pushed in.
Kass just disappeared right there. That inhibitor. Almost take one. Back to base they go.
He's still taking some damage from Frog and piercing arrows. He is absolutely hurting. Even has himself a Mercurial. Very safe build from Froggen this time. Hasn't been punished whatsoever. 100% kill participation on that too. Froggen, maybe that's about to change if he's caught out a little bit hard, gets kicked by Shook, but Shook is intent on finishing him off here and he will get him. There's the shutdown gold. It goes over to Freeze. Meanwhile, the tower is gonna fall in the mid. Copenhagen Wolves do manage to get a little bit here. Some misplays by Elements.
That was actually really cool what Freeze did there. Kalista's Ren range is not that big, but it becomes bigger. Hang on, Soren getting caught here. Let's finish that story right after.
There was a very quick Rek'Sai going right by his left.
So rude, interrupting me all the time. But yeah, he executed the Golem, which was in his range, and that allowed the maximum range slow Ren on Frog and slowed him down enough for the kill. So a good read there by Freeze. He was out of range of the Ren, in traditional range on Frog, but because he procced it on a Golem, then the range becomes bigger. Good play by Freeze. Sadly, a little bit late. They're using this opening with Froggen down to maybe get a tower in the base of Elements, though.
It just might do it, though. Still going very far forward. JWoww goes forward with a golden burn. And now the Wolves have to scurry away as fast as they can. Froggen takes a shot onto Kass, gets him down. A double kill as he finds Soren as well. The Wolves, in their desperate attempt to finish an inhibitor, might get aced themselves. Lenny and Freeze on the run. Dexter marching forward at the front. The arrow still hits Lenny and the chase is still going.
Damn it, Nif with the Superman. Whenever you proc a hook on a black shield, they keep moving, but your tether is still connected. But he pussied out. He flashed defensively. True aggressive support, a bloodthirsty support. Flashed aggressively and slow that Azir down. Eventually he drops though. Copenhagen Wolves are now down 9,000 gold. One inhibitor. Look at that wave in the top though.
Big wave pushing indeed. Elements will have to do this one quick and go back to grab seconds up on the top side. Four members here. With the respawn, JWoww, he'll be the one sent to defend the tower. Speaking of towers, that's already gone for Copenhagen Wolves in the middle. Inhibitor should be fired all the way down, but Lenny, Soren, and the rest of the Wolves are here to stop it.
And it's such a terrible task for Shook, honestly, to play Lee Sin into Thresh who could play, or not.
Or maybe just go right on forward. He's gonna get taken down. Meanwhile, Freeze was able to pick off Nip, but a teleport now coming in for JWoww. Lenny looking for Froggen. He's gonna get melted. Kass actually picks the kill off, not before an equalizer drops, and Dexter comes in. A big pushback from the Emperor of Shurima. Elements, what is going on? They've lost three for Shook.
This is one of those moments where I was talking about how hard it is for Shook to go in against the Thresh who can flay you out of your Sonic Wave, second proc, or Dexter who can knock you up mid-flight. Any of those would have done. Shook kicks in Nith, who was too late with the flay. And that opened up Frogger to get caught. And then Elements chose to fight it still. Equalizer went wide, get triple taunted, and allow the Wolves to pick up this. This was Fifth Dragon. This is a very, very sloppy mistake from Elements. They weren't taking anything in the early to mid game, and now they wanted too much. They wanted mid inhibitor and that big top wave right before Fifth Dragon.
Got a little antsy in the pants. He gave themselves up a dragon. Let's take a look at how it happened again, though.
All right, watch Shook. Normally, when you proc this Q, you don't want to go in because if you respect your opponent, he will cancel you, but knockup comes too late. Still kicks in Nip. Keep your eyes on Froggen right now. He jukes out, but he gets taunted. Morgana ulti slows him down enough. Then there's Fate's call to knock him in. He doesn't have anything. Equalizer gets stepped out. They choose to fight Lenny. Triple taunt right here. Dexter gets blown up. Has to flash out defensively too, so the Elements lose their offensive engages in terms of their flashes. They lose Fifth Dragon.
There's a naked inhibitor on the top side, or the bottom side, that the Wolves could eyeball. They need to push back against the super minions in the bottom first to do it. But Elements, they're stacking up around this Baron. They could secure it. However, there's a potential for the counter engage. Lenny got both his teleports available if he chooses to use them, but he's going to have to act fast. Baron,
they're late.
Already at half health. The Wolves will not get here in time. This is going down. Elements managed to get themselves a Baron as the Wolves come in late to the party. In comes Freeze, in comes Lenny, in comes Kaz, but they're just gonna serve themselves up on a plate. That's gonna be 1-2 down. Freeze nearly burning as well. The hook doesn't connect on Soren, but man, is it close. Freeze hopping, skipping, jumping as much as he can. Soren tries to get the pushback, but he might sacrifice himself. Goes golden on it as JWoww takes down Shook, and the Wolves have all but fallen as Freeze, the only one left. That might be the game right there. In comes Dexter.
The Wolves didn't come to play League of Legends. They're doing sightseeing. This is maybe the fifth objective that they just stand around, watch it go down. Freeze, he fates calls his Morgana, which has a black shield to dodge that hook. Then he walks straight into the hook, sacrifices his life. Of course, it's going to be hard for Kaz to shield him when you're stuck as a ghost. And that's fates call. Misplay on multiple ends by the Wolves and Elements looking to close out this game.
Should be able to do it just shy of 40 minutes. They make their mid-game fight count a last stand for the Wolves, but Kaz is already burning. Fate's call pulled back in, but it doesn't matter. When the Nexus is going down, they can't do it. And Elements come up with the win.
And for Elements, critique where critique is due, but they did what they have to do. And their draft was good. And this is something in the season so far, we've had many complaints about Elements, but they came out with a fantastic draft here. Double poke, mixed damage. Rumble in the top lane to facilitate the 80 mid laner Varus, which has incredibly high win rate. In addition to rather low pick rate because he gets banned out so often. Corki picked up the Kalista. Kalista neutralized in the early game. These are all positive things for Elements. However, the next step just isn't quite there yet, and they have to watch this VOD. For me, the main thing to work on is the synergy between Dexter and Niff. They need to buddy up, start roaming together. Get that vision out, because Froggen, he played out of his mind. Fantastic game.
Absolutely.
11-2 and 7.
But you're right, they need to find that extra magic. They need to find that extra synergy. And they need it fast if they want to be able to compete in the playoffs. They're close to qualifying. It's still very close in the middle of the table here. But a win here, definitely important for them. They're going to have a tough game tomorrow. They're going to have Gambit and SK following that.
Yep.
They can't afford to make these kind of mistakes against stronger teams, whether it's the rest of the season, whether it's in the playoffs.
Now we'll have to see Elements, obviously, coming into this week. Given the position they're in, they obviously expected this match to go into their...
on stage with their new jungler to take on SK Gaming. So let's start by taking a look at that new Unicorns of Love lineup. Of course, people we do know, Vizachachi, Power of Evil, Vardax, Hillisang, and Shippy. And their replacing Kikis in the jungle is Jilius, a relatively known face for the Unicorns of Love, but what are they losing by losing Kikis?
Well, it's a new old new face, of course. Jilius was in the team before moving out for Kikis, and I think Kikis' shoes are going to be very big to fill. This is a guy who had an 89% kill participation before 15 minutes. He was number one in awards per minute as well, and number two in awards killed per minute. So he's bringing assists to his team, he's bringing kills to his team, he's bringing vision, and he's denying vision. Jilius has a massive task ahead of him to replace this man.
He does, and Jilius is in a very weird 50-50 situation. He's fortunate in the fact that he has experience on the biggest stage with Worlds, not a lot of experience on the LCS stage itself. In Challenger, we've been watching Jilius for a very long time now, and he has never really settled himself as one of the top junglers in Challenger. There's always been somebody else that's been making a name for themselves above them. He's kind of struggled with decision-making on Gamers 2, and decision-making in general is a problem that the Unicorns of Love have themselves. If he's not a strong shot caller here, Unicorns of Love won't be getting as much as they're losing with KKS, in my opinion.
Now, great point, because with all of that, they are now 9-9, but they of course want to get to the playoffs, the Unicorns of Love, and they're coming off a 2-0 week, and now they have to adjust to everything. If we take a look at their schedule, they're playing SK today, then they're playing Gambit, the Giants, and Fnatic. I feel like outside of Fnatic, it could be doable for them to win three of those games, but I feel like especially Gambit and Giant might be the teams that rise above in that playoff race.
Up until the substitution, you could have even thought Unicorns could take down Fnatic, because this is just something they could do. Today, Giants imploded. They did not look good. So that's a positive for UOL in their playoff hopes. And maybe Gillies is going to bring some magic to the team that even Fnatic cannot account for. So there is the possibilities, but I'm going to echo that sentiment. There is a strong possibility for UOL to make playoffs in the next week or two and then set themselves up for another strong BO5 sets.
For anybody that maybe is a newer fan of Unicorns, I love Gillies, did used to play on the team, is, you know, welcome to their style of mixing things up. So maybe they got a couple of special things off this week of practice.
We'll see a lot of pressure on his shoulders. Just a footnote, though, if the Unicorns of Love make it to the playoffs, that would put them in a very good position to maybe make Worlds through championship points. They are currently sitting at 70, which is 20 above H2K. So, Julius, you better step out, man, and start right now, because you guys are playing SK Gaming. Let's take a look at that lineup. Freddy122, Svenskeren, Fox, Candy Panda, and Rated, and our coach, Lukas Schenke. Well, if we talk about the teams that UOL still has to play, let's look at the ones SK still has left to play, because that will be a big feat. As said, UOL, then Origin, Fnatic, and then Elements, who we've seen can definitely pull out a win as well. It's looking dire for SK Gaming. We can't beat around the bush.
That is a very tough schedule overall. And, you know, for SK Gaming, okay, they look great against Copenhagen Wolves, but Copenhagen Wolves are a far shadow from those four teams that have just listed. Elements will be perhaps the quote-unquote easiest game, but even then, Elements are improving. SK, are they at a level where I think that they're comfortable in any of those games right now? I would have to say no.
And it's also the whole team, whenever we hear interviews with them, whenever you hear any of the social media presence, it's a difficult situation. The team members are not particularly happy. They're looking towards promotion tournament, and that is where they're setting their goals. If SK get a little bit of luck, they can make playoffs, but realistically, they're looking to aim for 7th to avoid promo, at best 8th to pick their opponents.
We will see what they can do. It's almost time for the first of SK's many tests. And as we head over to the casters, we'll hear from Fox and how he thinks they have a good chance without Kikis in the enemy jungle versus UOL.
I think UOL will be a lot weaker, because Kikis, like, I feel he was really the strong point. Like, he would make plays on Gragas and stuff, and he was the most unpredictable player on their team. So I think it will be like easier game for us than with Kikis on the lineup.
Well, Fox think the magic is going to be all gone, but we'll have to see with this new Unicorns lineup that is actually the old Unicorns lineup when you really think about it.
Yeah, and the one thing we didn't really touch about too much is that Julius played for SK at the World Championship. He subbed in, played 3 games. He went through that boot camp, and SK went back to their original lineup as well, in a sense, with the Candy Panda Rated bot lane back in the game. So they have a lot of things. SK always came out in an interview and said, we want to go back to the SK of old. We want to play our traditional style, not the new Forgiven style that we developed over time. So Julius should know exactly what their strengths and weaknesses are. And maybe he can bring that to the table for the Unicorns of Love. And he does that immediately with the first ban.
That Lulu ban, it has been one of the winningest champion for SK's support player. Not to dip a little bit deeper into his pool this time around. The Rek'Sai is also banned away. Ryze has taken off the board against Chachi. Has had some mixed success on that champion.
I want to see some pressure on Shen. Definitely good performances by Freddy on that champion so far. Freddy, when you let him split push on his own, provide him with a decent baseline of vision, give enough farm to him, and let him split push with these beefy type of champions like Shen, he actually has a lot of impact in the game. Where it was to put Shyvana too, and he was really good at controlling that side of the map, and then opens up SK to play at the other side very easily. Screen out up for the Morgana.
He was one of the first, really, to bring those back. The Shen, I think, is definitely no-brainer here unless the Unicorns decide to take it away. It's still sitting available with the Morgana ban, the Sivir ban. We'll probably be seeing for potentially those Kalistas. Now the Gragas is banned away. This dips the jungle pool back a little bit, but we've been seeing some comfort. Jilius going back. Okay, Lee Sin now. That's a first pickup.
That's a statement for Unicorns to say, okay, first game on stage here. Traditionally, Lee Sin isn't as prioritized. Obviously, with jungle bans in here, say, okay, Jilius, we'll sacrifice our first picks just so you feel comfortable. Make some plays. You see, it's different doing it at home. Or right here, it's a lot different on stage. But this gives that Shen, that coveted Shen pick to SK Gaming, and they're hovering right now, Corki. Next in line, traditionally.
Next in line, indeed. Definitely thinking about if they want to take this right away. Make quite a lot of sense for them, and they will lock it in. Prompts Unicorns going back the next. Let's see, now that they've got their jungle all figured out, where did they go from here? We've got Thresh Kalista available. We've seen Kalista, even despite the nerfs, be used to great success so far today. Will Unicorns take that and replicate it?
Candy Panda usually went for that. Kalista got ahead very far in the early starts of the season. I still remember distinctly a 5-0 or 2-0 Kalista, but he never could capitalize on that lead. Says, okay, I'm rather play for the mid game. I want to want a siege once Shen is split pushing. Want the earlier spike on the map. Perhaps the nerfs were too much. And Vardax doesn't strike me as a carry Kalista player either. So I wonder what he's going to end up picking.
He does like this Jinx, but we have seen it fall flat on a couple occasions. It's bold, but it's not like it's without some protection. This Lee Sin should be mobile enough. Small shield provided from that safeguard as well. We might be seeing a lot of attention paid to the bot side, unless SK don't necessarily have an extremely strong support to back up this Corki.
We'll have to see if Freddy can survive that 1-on-1 matchup against the Rumble. In my head, that plays out in the Rumble's favor. Obviously, I still have to see it. Once Shen picks up magic resistance, he's fine, but in the early levels, I feel like Rumble could bully that lane with the Flame Spitter, and later in the fight, Taunt Flash is what we'll have to watch out for, and Unicorns can't rely on that coveted Morgana pick that Hillsang played very often. Mm-hmm. So he might actually have to go for a Janna or an Alistar to provide sufficient peel. SK can steal that away right here though, but they're setting up for quite some poke here. Nidalee Hover.
Yeah, and Svenskeren, one of the Nidalee proponents here in Europe. It hasn't been seen as much for a little bit, but now with the changes coming in, we've got that locked. We've got a Gnar though, which means...
Maiden Switch. Maiden Switch by SK Gaming and Rated, saying, hey, I watched people play Shen support. It is pretty strong. I want to pick it up. SK, however, have to reveal it early, and the Unicorns were waiting for that. They were waiting for that pick to be revealed. Now they can answer with what they want. Interesting lineup for SK so far. Triple poke, in a sense, if you can call Gnar poke, but they have good zone control around objectives. They have the hard engage from the Shen Flash Taunt to get to that Jinx.
They can definitely wombo combo up between those two, and solid mid-game from that Corki. Damage. We'll see what they round it out with. But for Unicorns, right now, if the hovers end up being what they go for here, I've not really been incredibly impressed with Power of Evil's Orianna. Yeah, I think it makes more sense to switch it out. You can already see that summoner spell on Power. I think in the next couple seconds, we're going to find out. Looks like we will be in for another good old game of Runeglaive Ezreal.
Yeah, Ezreal in the mid lane, giving a poke component to that UL lineup. Usually, though, when we see the Unicorns play poke, it is Power of Evil has that pick in mind, and they build a fortress around him. The one time they did not do that was with AP Kog'Maw, and they fell flat. They didn't have the defensive tools. Vardax ended up needing peel on those AD carries, didn't get it, and the Unicorns crumbled. However, Ezreal, as a champion, fends for himself a little better than AP Kog'Maw. Mm-hmm. This case says, we choose poke. Unicorns say, we will match that in the mid lane at least. For some hard engage. A little mix and match composition though for the Unicorns. It doesn't really spell out a single strategy. It's a combination of many things. I want to see if that actually works out. I feel like SK Gaming had a bigger, broad plan in mind. This Jace pick is not a surprise to them. They could start this pick and ban process because they knew both Jace and Varus were open. The one risk they have is running heavy on 80 damage, but that's why they have a magic damage jungler in the Nidalee.
And some mixed damage available from the Corki as well.
And then
it gives them a nice balance.
And then they put the tank component on their support. This is a very well-rounded composition on SK Gaming. The only thing that you could argue is counter engage is rough, so they'll need to play well around their Gnar bar, get his Mega Gnar form out for the counter engage and the peel. But if you look at both drafts from an outside point of view, SK seem to be better prepared, and Unicorns, looking at those comfort picks, more so. So they'll need a snowball. The man to watch definitely is Vardax, because Power of Evil is going to yield some pressure early. Chachi, interesting to see how that matchup plays out. I feel Gnar will bully out the Rumble.
Yeah. And if that's the case, though, the Unicorns are expecting it. Do you expect them maybe to try to go for the lane swap? They will give up Dragon Pressure if they do that, among other things.
Lane swap could be viable, for sure. Lane swapping in general is good when you play with a Rumble overall, and a Jinx can take the tower down very quickly and avoid Gnarly early phase. Definitely an option for the Unicorns.
The Gnar also should function fairly effectively well in the lane swap situation, as long as he doesn't get himself caught too far up, so we'll have to see.
Definitely, but he wants to get a little beefy at least. He wants to get stronger, but we'll see about that later.
For now, though, guys, that is all for the picks and bans. The team comps are locked in, so why don't you at home tell us who you think is going to walk away with a win here. Will it be the Unicorns? If so, hashtag UOL win. If SK can make their climb back up out of relegation territory, tweet hashtag SK win. As this game gets underway, we'll find out who's going to win as we load up onto the Rift. SK Gaming taking on the Unicorns of Love.
Now, if these standard lanes happen, I wonder where the push advantage will be. I haven't seen too much of Shen's support in the early laning phase. 2v2, how it plays out. The biggest component of why it's strong is because you want to dash in aggressively and then have that taunt connect for the AD carry, force him to trade on the support. Generally, when you trade in bot lane, if you can trade on the AD carry and force him to hit your support, you're obviously winning that support's coming to lane with many more potions than AD carries do.
Taking a lot of time waiting around to try and sniff anything out with the line of scrimmage opening. If they do want to go for a swap, that's going to have to happen quickly, but it looks like at this point it's not going to happen.
Now, traditionally, when you face a team with a new member, swapping is obviously in your advantage because he's not used to those routines. He's not used to playing lane swaps on the stage. Gilius has some experience previously in Gamers 2, of course, in the Challenger scene, so he's not he's no stranger to swaps. SK traditionally haven't had the best lane swap either, and they do play well when Freddy himself gets ahead on that single lane. So it looks like standard lane so far, Pyra.
One differentiating thing, Chachi going very far forward. He definitely is a man that plays without a whole lot of fear, to be honest. But it could be dangerous for him if Svenskeren sticks around on this top side. He does place the ward in his own River Brush. Let's take a look back to when these guys met, though, because it was a win for SK. It was a very different time for the Unicorns. They were still very struggling to find their way in the summer split. And as a result, you know, you could see how close it was. It was actually lower gold, lower kills, but SK were still able to come out ahead at the end of the day.
Choosing to take the small golem down first, prevent opting to save more HP on their side. Right now we see the other bot lane of SK Gaming taking the Grump. On that respective side, in terms of leashes, what ended up happening was Freddy leashed for topside, so he's a little weaker in his lane in terms of presence. Fox was first to lane in mid, so he could have the push advantage there.
Now the bottom laners will meet each other there. Quick level two, it's Candy Panda and N-Rated push themselves forward. Bardex and Millicent will have to be a little bit careful, even on this Jinx Thresh lane, N-Rated. He hits level two, goes in, gets the taunt onto Hilly. There's gonna be the Foss Bomb. Still some damage as they have the vision, but N-Rated tanks a little bit of it as well. Lots of poke, gotta be careful not to give an early kill over to the Jinx.
Decent trade on both sides. N-Rated tried to zone level one. Feel UOL could have disrespected that zone a little more, but they said, okay, it's fine, just push us in, we'll farm on the tower. We have the scaling carry, the hyper carry on Jinx. We don't want to get Vardex behind. Now they are in a position where they're honestly safe under their tower. It's actually a trend we see a lot more. Teams like to just get pushed in and just farm on the tower as they support AD carry synergies are getting better. You're playing into a melee range champion Shen, so he can't bully you on their tower either. However, that then again turns into SK's favor. They like playing like this. They like pushing all lanes because this allows Svenskeren, the jungler, to invade the enemy jungle, get vision. And either he sees the camps empty, that he knows Gilius is on the left side, or he finds camps up and then he knows, okay, Gilius is still coming this way. Right now, it's clear to Svenskeren that he should tell his top laner, hey, Gilius started bot side, he might be top side, be careful.
Looks like the word came a little bit too late. Freddy nowhere near on the Gnar bar. Gets his hop, gets his flash. Ooh. Not connecting the Sonic Wave. That's going to save his life. Close call for the Gnar.
Couple nice plays there. Chachi opening with the flash E on the Rumble was good because that immediately slows Freddy and it forces him to still be slowed after he flashes. This could have been a follow-up kill, but good juke then in turn by Freddy. So good mechanical plays on both sides. Killer's missing his first Q on champion of the game. Hopefully he doesn't get into his head. Svenskeren though.
Underestimate the power of tilt. Svenskeren Throws the spear, dodged out by Gilius, trying to provide some counter pressure. This is textbook Svenskeren. He wants to get counter pressure all around the map. If he can find and get a kill, he will. But with the help of Visichachi, Gilius is able to secure the blue buff for himself. Starting this one off. And Hillisang going a little low in the bottom. Gets out though.
Ignite used on the side of SK Gaming, and this is showing why they value that Shen pick in the support, even though Freddy did well with it. Traditionally, Raiders seems to have practiced his champion Vardex.
Yep, there's the taunt. No wind belt escapes for the Jinx without the support there. It's going to be a little difficult for him to be able to trade for just a moment. So he gets some return damage on N-rated, but all the same, SK Gaming doing well to start this game off.
Now, SK Gaming are low in the standings, but that doesn't mean they've had a poor early and mid game. This is what they like to do, triple push. Push in mid, with Fox and Jason. Gilius looking to stop that right now. Gate is used, so can't speed himself up.
And Power of Evil still pushing the poke. Another missed connection, but Gilius is going to flash for it anyways. In comes Sven to turn it right around. Gilius knocked back, and Svenskeren will finish him off. First blood, the spear connects. Svenskeren thinks about going under tower, but he won't.
His body. Still giving yes. Good move, honestly.
I think he listened to his mind.
By Fox. It's a bold move to juke that Q, because if it connects, you're very likely to be dead. And it's very hard to judge whether that was going to connect. Good sidestep here, and pressure on Power of Evil, and Gilius is not having the start that he was looking for. Two Qs juked in a row. Power of Evil has to yield that turret early.
And
SK Gaming play
too.
Textbook SK style. Push all lanes, counter jungle, find the jungler, and then predict his movements and counter gank him.
This is something that Svenskeren has a lot of experience in doing. Gilius is definitely having a hard time living within his own jungle. He will grab himself some Gromp, but for now, Sven is still waiting on the backside, on the outside here. He's going to go ahead back to base just to finish up his jungling item, but the pressure is on the side of SK Gaming. They've got themselves a 1,000 gold lead, and it's only 6 minutes into the game.
And we're seeing N-Rated move out of his lane, and Roman put pressure on the map too. This is traditionally not something we're quite used to from him, so that's also a good move. Candy Panda confident in his trading ability, so he picks up the Sheen early. There's two ways you can play Corki Phage for the extended trades. You know, get that movement speed whenever you auto-attack, or short trades, short burst, Phosphorus Bomb, auto-attack, proc out. Beat that Jinx, who has to stack up minigun over time, unless you land Zap.
Well, that's somebody that SK have to keep their eyes on. Vardax, if he gets himself rolling a couple of kills or just eventually hitting those item spikes, it will be very dangerous for SK, but deny a Jinx, shut a Jinx down, and there's not much it can really do. Vardax and Hilly getting a wave pushed right in their direction, but they have to respect that taunt potential from N-Rated.
And this is why they play under Nertara, obviously, and N-Rated can't taunt in, because he'll meet the flay and the hook. He'll have to use his flash defensively, but the pressure is on the side of SK, and N-Rated can leave this lane whenever he wants. And leave Candy Panda safe, because the wave will bounce back. He can't be denied too much CS. UL can't freeze. This means that SK can move their vision forward. I'm a big fan of that ward in the dragon pick, but they just want to find out where Gilius is. They don't want him to jump over the wall and do the sneaky dragon. And if they find out roughly where he is, they can keep pushing, 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 and allow Svenskeren to dictate the pace of this game.
It really has been the difference between the junglers so far. Gilius makes his way down towards the bottom side. However, he is on a collision course for Svenskeren as he goes to start off his red buff. This could end in disaster. Dodges the spear. Sven, however, has him on the run for now. It's a tense moment, but N-Rated is coming in for backup. No help is coming for the Unicorn's jungler.
This is why whoever has the pushing lanes has a jungle advantage, because the blades can always move first. Good move by Candy Panda and N-Rated, and they're not losing anything, because if ULs choose to push up, they expose them to a potential flank.
This is exactly what's happening. In comes the Valk, stopped for just a moment. The taunt is avoided, but Hilly is still going down. Vardax lands the traps, lands the zap, but helps too late in coming. Ooh. And now the Jace is on the chase. Fox to the skies, and he takes down Vardax.
Some fancy footwork from Vardax, flashes in the wrong direction in the end. Fox comes in again, because Fox is pushing mid. He can move first to bottom. So SK are moving their chess pieces around the board, leaving Unicorns of Love trapped. Checkmate, eventually you lose your members then.
Just a little bit of damage on that mid tower. Power of Evil, not the greatest trade when you lose those two members on the bottom side. SK continuing to hold the pressure. The lead they have built has extended to 2,000 gold. Svenskeren, however, does the smart thing, throws the spear into the suspicious brush.
Good read by Sven. He knows if you play action around bottom right side, That leaves your top left side exposed. Always mirror map place. Or Freddy,
he's going
by Jachi.
Flashed away, and Freddy wasn't really aware of it at the time. Sven is going to be able to back him up, however, leaps on and takes down the Rumble. Another kill.
Freddy with the illustrious Confusion Rock. Throws it backwards. Chachi stops. Why? Suddenly, Svensson jumps out of the shadow, says, hello! Fusion Rock, best rock.
Definitely worked out that time. Sven has been a part of every one of the kills on the map so far. We're not even 10 minutes in. The pressure he has exerted cannot be understated. SK Gaming, they look to be setting up to catch Hillisang in this pincer, and he realizes Doom a little too late, walks into the Shock Blast, and the taunt gets the box down, but he won't save his life. And that's about it for the support player.
Good roam again by Enraider, then he's opening up his playstyle. Traditionally, when he played with Forgiven, he was always tied like glue. Forgive him right now. He's getting the liberty to roam around, and this is a pick. Corki facilitates that. Corki actually doesn't need a support in his lane because he can just farm those waves with the rockets, with the range. Well, he has an advantage, and you said it right there. Svenskeren, when he gets this style, he's one of the best junglers in Europe at capitalizing on that. So the aggressive push lanes and find the enemy jungler controlled. Reminds me a bit of Move and Rush over in North America. The one issue I have with it is if SK doesn't play this style, if you can push them back early, Svenskeren seems a little lost sometimes. Fox,
it's not a problem for the fist yet. In comes the stand United. Svenskeren looks to pick on Gilius, but Visit Chachi came in on the back of it. Fox will knock Gilius, but he gets kicked back. The right rocket hits him in the face. It's a one for one, but the skirmish is on, and Svenskeren going a little low. True Shot Barrage. Candy is going to flash right in front of it.
Luckily for Candy Panda, you can't get hit by two shot barrage twice. Otherwise, that would have been.
Yeah, that wouldn't work. Physics doesn't allow it.
Yep.
Meanwhile, though, Unicorns have a chance here to push in the middle. They should be able to take this turret down. They may even be able to rush down the dragon. Svenskeren a little bit low. Let's see what they decide to go for. Getting excited is Vardax here. And they'll just keep on going.
Yeah, Freddy used that teleport, presumably to get back to lane. Unicorns of Love use a teleport advantage. Simply walk down. Chachi has his teleports on a longer cooldown. Down to the mid, and they find an opening, and this is what they needed. To stop the bleeding, but they're still a significant amount of gold behind. Yes, they got those fancy kills and flashes, but Freddy took a tower in the top lane, so that was traded. Gold lead still very, very big on the Unicorns, or on SK side, rather.
And the dragon might have to wait for another day, too. SK collapsing around, throwing some muscle in their direction. Unicorns will scatter away, and a Shock Blast sends Gilius and Visit Chachi reeling for a second. Dragon could be started by SK at this point, as Freddy is still pushing uncontested in the top.
SK Gaming here to make a statement. We want to get into playoffs. We don't want to be in relegation. Coming out fierce, and this is the progress we were looking at the past few weeks already, but they just kept having these...
Uh-oh. Svenskeren, he didn't get the jump.
No energy on Gilius, though.
There we go, he's out of it. He gets kicked back, so close to taking him down, courtesy of the Runeglaive, and Fox will manage to finish the job. Power of Evil gets away from the spear. The rocket connects on Sven's back, but it doesn't finish the job.
Yes, Svenskeren, he was losing that duel, but then he checked over Gilius. No more energy. Easily turn that around. Fox came in. SK's playing well together in unison. Good synergy here.
Millie, though, is looking to make a pick onto Candy Panda. The hook goes completely the wrong direction as he predicted incorrectly where he was going to go. Now, overextending just a little bit. Freddy has his Gnar bar all the way. Almost gets the hit, but he gets the big Gnar onto Vardax, and Svenskeren secures the kill. They might be looking towards the bottom tower now, Crapo.
Just because there is a lantern doesn't mean you have to click it. Vardax learned that the hard way. SK taking another tower right here. Opening up the map, and every week we go on, SK is getting better and better. They still have to learn how to close. But definitely early game, very, very impressive. To be 5,000 gold up against the Unicorns, who are ahead in the standings of SK Gaming, is an impressive feat.
Absolutely. And it is just the right timing for them towards the end of this split. They want to have a shot at continuing to move forward. Remember, they're still sitting on some championship points from the fourth place finish back in spring. They could very well do it. Now, Gilius trying for some counter jungling, but Sven is going to find him and take him down. He doesn't even need the red buff. He goes ahead and gives that one over to Fox.
Counter jungle attempt thwarted by SK Gaming. Look at the vision they have in the bottom side of the map as well. They don't even need to see their own jungle, because by process of elimination, they can find out where Gilius is. If he's not in the top right jungle, because we just walked there, if he's not in the bottom right jungle, because we have wards there, he must be on the left side. Hillisang, though.
Freddy is ignited. Freddy is in trouble, but he's got a Shen at his back. He's gone Meganar. The tables are turning. Unicorn's bit off way more than they could chew, and the equalizer won't do enough. The rock, Svenskeren pulled in. There's the play taken down. No tower to fall back to. SK Gaming keep on rolling.
And Rated with an impressive performance, honestly, delivering on the support Shen. We said Freddy's Shen was phenomenal so far, but they opt to pick it away. Bait, Unicorns in, donated. Two and Rated. Say, Freddy, you can still play other champions on that Gnar. 005 delivering as well. Overall, fantastic play by SK so far.
So far, so good. You know, we're 15 minutes into this game right now. The lead is incredibly significant. A dragon, oh, damage from Fox. Another tower taken down. Now they're sitting on about 8,000 ahead, or a little less than 8,000 ahead, I should say. It's still, it's getting pretty hard for Unicorns to handle.
And this is the problem if you pick three losing lanes against an aggressive jungler like Svenskeren. They'll abuse that, allow those lanes to snowball. And we've seen this in the past from the Unicorns, where they say, okay, mid game, we have this beautiful composition. But getting there is our problem. Yet again, they pick Vogue scaling for Power of Evil. He is sitting back in his lane. No offensiveness, no like foresight, just playing back. Vardex is playing his Jinx. Back in spring, yes, Hillisang and Vardex were so good at laning phase that they could start getting one or two kills in the lane, but that's no longer the case. These teams are leveling up. Dying bot lane 2v2 just simply doesn't happen anymore. The game has evolved past that stage.
And for the Unicorns too, I mean, their mid-game fight, a lot of it is hinging on Chachi being relevant, on Vardex being able to get ahead. Neither of those things have happened. Power of Evil has a fantastic late game in this room, Glaive Ezreal. We've all seen Pepinero go absolutely crazy on this, but the rate this game is going, they may not make it that long.
Definitely won't. And honestly, Fox and Jace, been impressive. Going back all the way to minute two, that was leashes. Fox did not leash, so he got the immediate push in the mid lane. Freddy leashed, but he can still outpush the Rumble. Whereas Unicorns, they opted to let Power of Evil help his jungler, Gilius, to get him into the game.
He
lost the mid lane push, and then, yeah, in turn, Svenskeren invaded. Look at the Shock Blast right now. This is what you're up against. Shock Blast, Rocket Poke, Taunt Flash, Nidalee Spears.
And it's scaling Nidalee, too. I mean, we're seeing the Diamond Procs build. Now that it's on 513, the Rod of Ages with that scaling that it's had increased a little bit, even if its base stats aren't quite so good.
Better offense, worse defense, but Svenskeren's fine with that because all he needs is offense.
And he keeps taking jungle camps away.
This game, offense is the best defense for him.
It might get caught for just a second, going a little far forward. Gonna leap over the wall. Freddy's there for the defense. The spear is going to connect. The reinforcements have arrived, and Chachi is going down. Fox is hooked in. True Shot Barrage comes in. The rockets are flying. Unicorns are firing the heavy artillery, but it's just not enough as the double kill comes in for Fox. Gilius tries to make the outplay. Will be able to finish off Svenskeren. It's going to be a 1-for-3, though. Goodbye, Fox with another.
And this has been the name of the game, and so close, Vardex with another rocket connecting, but 5% for Svenskeren earlier, 3% for Svenskeren, and every time SK fight, their backup arrives first. A full-on team play.
Oh!
This roster here, Candy Panda wants more.
He wants the kill! Vardex just not going to give it to him. Two summoners to escape, but the tower's gone. SK have turned the gas on.
Yeah, and this is the first time I've seen, well, not the first time, but the best I've seen SK work together as a team. Every time one of their members plays aggressive and oversteps their boundaries just ever so slightly, somebody's there, mainly Fox. He is driving his game, 8-1-2. Let's watch that again. Svenskeren gets the jungle, pressing dual Chachi. He's doing the top laner, Power Evil comes in. The fact that he escapes is impressive feat on its own. He connects back, he jumps, he doesn't go chasing to the equalizer. He knows Fox can finish it off. Watch the rocket, top right. This is so frustrating for Vardex, so low. If there were any wolves left, he would proc them. There's an animation on Arcane Shift. That animation wasn't quick enough. Julius, fancy footwork, but not quite enough.
Yeah, going back to what you were saying about SK, this is definitely the most coordinated we've seen them this split. And this is a scary thing for Unicorns. Remember, this is a team that's still right in the middle of the table, competing for playoff seeding, sitting on a lot of championship points, hoping to be able to secure their berth to Worlds after all said and done. You cannot let yourself get this far behind against this team. They've given SK everything they've wanted, and it looks like a comfortable game for them so far.
Yeah, playing Thresh into champions like this is so incredibly hard because every time you stand still to land the hook, you get poked.
And you get poked by a lot. Tower now going very low, going down to SK Gaming. Freddy playing well around that Gnar bar right now. Unicorns are starting to have to respect that. Dragon's live again, but SK haven't really needed Dragon so much this game. They're going to keep on pushing in the bottom side.
Can they close? That is the million-dollar question right now for SK Gaming. We've seen them get leads at 10, at 20. Can they push it onwards? Can they close out?
Got some damage. True shot barrage. Rocket, not enough. Equalizer isn't. Neither is finally. He valks right into the tip of the Equalizer, and Chachi will finish off the elusive Corki, but Freddy's still putting pressure in the bottom, or in the mid, I should say. Unicorns have a member advantage, but it's only for 20 seconds.
Yeah, lapse in judgment. You can see SK peel back here. Chachi.
Might not last. He's still stunned. The hook's gonna come in. Chachi, he can't do it. He's taunted forever. And down he goes. Power of Evil took some damage on top of it. SK, they're just so far ahead, they've got this damage.
Meganar with the gains, blocking that lantern. Impossible to click it. SK even out. They could peel back for a dragon, transition into a Baron play if they want to go safely, because obviously in this metagame, there's a decent amount of wave clear. Good amount of wave clear on Power of Evil. It kind of plays into SL, pushing him in under the tower without being able to siege it down. This is what he wants. He wants time to scale, but moving away from that turret, look at Dragon, look at Baron. It's SK's playground at this point, 16-3.
SK have done exactly what they needed to do. They neutralize these threats on Unicorns. The Ezreal, he's gonna have a long path to scaling, still waiting on some items, 0-1 and 2 at 20 minutes into this game. Just picks up a blue buff, okay, sure, big whoop. Visit Chachi, 1-4, still sitting on the Haunting Guys, still sitting on the Seeker's Arm Guard. They're low in items. Even Vardax is not quite towards his static Shiv yet. They've been set so far behind that there's just so little that the Unicorns can do short of getting the perfect fight and snowballing off of Get Excited.
Yeah, and they definitely need an Aegis as well against this poke coming out of Nidalee and Corki. And at the same time, even if they do, Fox's Shock Blast will still hurt. Double penetration is enough to do damage though, because everybody on the side of SK Gaming is itemizing very offensively. So the raw damage from Rumble is there. Hits level 11, a power spike. Now let's see how good is SK's vision control and their decision making around this Baron pit. I like that pink ward on the right side. They force Power of Evil to use this ultimate. This is where you move back in mid. Beautiful. Push in the wave again. Repeat. See Power of Evil, you have one shock, one ultimate every 40 seconds. Well, we can bait more than that.
The brush towards. A little crowded.
He's scared.
And boom. Going forward, instantly flashing away. The rocket comes in, won't do nearly enough. SK Gaming like a horde of angry ants just popping out of the hill. And Unicorns are scattering the moment they see him.
Beautiful analogy right there. And this, well, honestly, was the perfect scenario for Unicorn. Their support face tanks, but survives. Everyone chases into an equalizer, but it wasn't enough. Round two.
And Chachi gonna burn his flash. Won't be enough. Svenskeren manages to take him down. Unicorns again scattering the bait and engage. SK continue to repeat it. Down goes Gilius. He got a kickoff, but that will not be enough. Might be Baron time.
And this is why it's better if you go for this very dominant map control style to buy pink wards instead of sweepers. Because then at least when teams move in their wards, sweepers go on cooldown. They're too slow, too long, but look at those pink wards. 1, 2, 3, and 4 pink wards on the side of SK Gaming. Complete vision control. Of course, the Glove have no answer. All their Baron Steel tools are gone. Ezreal ulti, Jinx ulti, Rumble Equalizer, all gone.
Oh, Nilly. He goes pretty far forward, throws a box down. That'll mean no one from Unicorns are going to chase, or no one from SK is going to chase too far into that. But importantly, where was this SK?
SK
in the last 7 weeks?
Yeah, thinking on a box right there and paying off. Honestly,
also a good analogy.
This, thank you for noticing. SK Gaming, they were there. They were a shade of this team. There were elements of it in their play, and they were constantly getting better. But call it throws, call it unfortunate plays, call it not so lucky. They lost a lot of dragons. They had gold leads and they didn't capitalize on them. But so far, this is the cleanest I've seen them execute against a team that is very hard, honestly, still to play against Unicorns, but they're missing one of their key members.
Mm-hmm. I mean, Fox said it early in our video before the start of this one. He didn't think that Unicorns had that same magic. And right now, it's ringing true. Gilius has not brought that level to this team. They first picked this Lee Sin, and it's not been able to do much.
And two of his Qs got juked. However, this is his first game on the big stage. Still need to give him some time. A couple of weeks is all he has, though.
Ooh, power. That is not good. One Shock Blast, 60% of his health. Freddy's on the bottom. They're pushing in two waves at once. Gilius trying to push back, but Freddy is stacking his Gnar bar. Meanwhile, the rest of SK is in the mid. Freddy manages to take it down. Gilius getting pushed back by the boomerang. Vardex trying to turn him away, but they're not defending this. In comes the big Gnar, knocks Vardex, gets a stun into the shock blast. They take him down. Freddy is eating the lasers, but he's still tanking through it. It's like a bad monster movie, and they get two for one and an inhibitor on top.
But Freddy's build, look at it, he has Frozen Mallet. Usually you talk about whether they go Frozen Mallet or Black Cleaver or the defensive option. Freddy just goes all of them. He goes full on offense. Heliosun gets poked out. SK looking to close out this game.
They might be able to do it here. We're not even 25 minutes in. This is going to be a big one now as SK Gaming will finish off the last Nexus turret, goes in for the taunt, blows up Heliosun, and now only Power's there to defend. He can't do it. 25 minutes in, SK Gaming with the win.
This is something we haven't seen in a while. Smiles on the faces of SK Gaming, animated in Candy Panda. There was rumored to be some turmoil, but the team stuck together, and this is honestly, it seems to have made them tighter as a team, as a pack. They played very well together. Impressive performance by animated on Shen. Everybody honestly carried their weight. Fox was the first one to move all the time, helped out Spensker, and he was the support to his jungler. Came in with the damage when Tensker needed most, and honestly, does anything tell the tale how confident SK were in this game was the two Lee Sin Sonic Waves that they juked. They had flashes, but they opted not to use them. Well, Freddy didn't the first time, but they kept juking and outplaying, outmaneuvering the Unicorns, and it showed.
Sometimes things just click. SK Gaming, this entire game, all five of them, they may not have gotten Dragonfly, but they had the glow. And they made it happen. Unicorns debuting Gilius, it wasn't all on him, but they just did not have the magic this time around.
And yeah, the opening to snowball the game, but it is very hard to play on stage after you've sat at home. Obviously still a very young player as well. A lot of eyes on him. It was at Worlds replacing Svenskeren for a bit, but that's been a while ago.
And it does go back to those lanes. You said it earlier.
Gambit will be taking on Origin. Let's take a look at Gambit's lineup, who will be on the blue side today. Cabochard, Diamond, Betsy, Forgiven, Gosu, Pippa, and the man that's helping the team be a team, it is Shaunce. They are currently tied with sixth place Rocket. Shaunce has also got on record, if we don't make playoffs, this season has been a failure. But securing that playoff spot won't be easy, because take a look at the teams they still have to face, Officio. Origin today, you're well tomorrow, maybe easier. Elements looking okay, and H2K had a great game.
Yeah, very tough schedule for Gambit, but I still feel like they can somewhat decide it themselves. I mean, if they beat Unicorns, if they beat Elements, that should be enough for top six placement, which is what they need with the lineup they have as well. I mean, you got players like Cabochard and Forgiven, you got legends like Gozu, Pippa, and Diamond. I mean, you should obviously aim for playoffs. They have improved, but I mean, it's slow and steady, honestly, for them. Every week it feels like they're getting better and better, and that's the highlight for Gambit, because playoffs is near, and two more weeks, new patch, could see some new changes maybe, and they might be ready.
So we'll find out if they can. Gambit is going to be facing their first step on that challenge. It will be the 10-4 Origin. Soaz, Amazing, Pekka, Niels, Mythy, and Leduc. This is a team that has already locked off a spot in the playoffs, along with Fnatic. I believe H2K as well. They need to hold on to second place to secure the bye into the semifinals and guarantee themselves some championship points.
Yeah, and Origin all split long have been a really, really strong team, especially if you look at their mid game for them where they excel. But we do see some coordination problems. This is against Fnatic, where they had this massive goal lead. Notice how they're fighting 3v5 at first. Niels comes in late, Source comes in late, and the damage dealers barely do anything here for Origin. And this is one of the mistakes they make that Fnatic as a team does not make. And that's the difference between them. If you just saw the rest of the game, Origin had a fantastic early game. They punished Fnatic on the sideline super effectively. Pekka is extremely strong if he gets to play something like a Twist of Fate, where he can have an impact in the early game. But the coordination late game, that's where they were lacking behind. It tends to not be a problem, though, against the lower ranked teams, because they cannot punish Origin the same way Fnatic could.
So for Origin, they really showed up against Fnatic last week, as did H2K the day before. But Origin, the general feeling is that even if they don't win summer playoffs, even if they don't get to Worlds that way, they should be the strongest contender at the moment when we get to that regional qualifier.
Yeah,
because there is the third way to qualify. You either win summer, you have the most championship points, or you win that regional qualifier, taking out everybody along the way.
Yeah, one of the things for Origin is we haven't really seen them being super tested in a best out of five yet, because obviously when they qualified from Challenger, they were so much better than the rest. We barely got to see anything. It was a 3-0 against Lowland Lions in the final. Now, in DLCS best out of one, pick and ban phase has been questioned a few times, and I feel like it's fair. I mean, we've seen either very heavy AP compositions, we've seen some first picks where they try to take them away from others, and we're like, oh, they give away so many power picks. Like, there's been a few questions is like from a lot of different people. I don't want to say it's been a bad pick and ban phase, but there have been times where like that could have been
optimal. It is debatable is the term that Fisher is looking for.
That's fair.
And when the team's 10-4 and they've had some great wins and some questionable losses, it is definitely the case. As a reminder to everybody at home, we are playing on 5-13. I think my favorite adaptation was that Rylai's second item from Ryu on Ahri. I thought it was great. Mm-hmm. And we'll see what Gambit and Origin decide to do. Vlad taken away from Pekka, one of his most successful champions that split, and nothing surprising yet.
No, Rumble ban against Source. We mentioned how Rumble is so, so strong here with the new changes. Ryze against Cabochot, the main carry of Gambit. So I feel like we have seen standard bans all across the day, but we've seen some very one-sided games. I mean, they've been snowballing heavily into the favor of one team, and maybe Gambit and Origin can change that.
Not necessarily the results we were expecting either. SK showing up big against UOL. One thing I would like to mention is that Forgiven has not played Kalista yet. It's one of the things that many people have questioned, but, and will it be first pick?
This is the big plan for Gambit.
The plan.
In case, like, we don't need to play Kalista, she will be slowly nerfed. You know, now was the first one. This is the master plan for Forgiven, and then when everyone's been using so much time on playing okay.
Ladies and gentlemen, Bilgewater is coming.
Don't tell me this is going to be an AP gang playing with
Evidently, sooner than any of us were expecting. Maybe it was Gragas, that's now Gangplank.
So this is not the first time we see teams have a very specific target ban against Gambit. A few weeks ago, randomly, Yasuo got banned against Cabochot. We were like, why? Okay.
This but then we found out.
Pick. Then 2 weeks later, he got to play it and got like 10 kills and whatever and completely carried the game. This could be another one. I mean, I've seen Gangplank mid as well. Could have been a Betsy pick. They're hitting instead. Alistar first pick. We mentioned Kalista is not the Forgiven champion. So Origin also can take away Corki, which will probably be the next choice for Forgiven himself.
We're still assuming that Forgiven will not be playing Kalista. What will he play instead? We've seen Graves come out. We've seen Ezreal a couple times. Lucian didn't work. So a lot of champions up and available. And also, with Nidalee up, with Gragas up, what does Diamond Prox lean towards in this game?
So, I mean, I would go Gragas in this case here, but it obviously depends on what Gambit wants to build. They don't have to show the jungler yet. We have a lot of strong picks in the mid lane. Azir and Jayce has been fantastic, in my opinion, from Betsy, two of the stronger picks. And he looks to be going for one of them, and Diamond might want to change it up and not go for that Gragas. I mean, Runeglaive, Nidalee, fantastic strong early game, but you have to be able to snowball it. If Gambit are picking purely strong lanes, Graves, Nidalee, I can see it work for them.
And we do see Diamond has trended towards that Nidalee in recent weeks. It worked very well just a moment ago for Svenskeren and SK. It will be the Jayce as well. So Gambit got the makings of a very heavy poke composition. Origin going to borrow the counter that Unicorns put into place, at least for the Jayce in the support Braum.
Yeah, the key thing though when Unicorns picked the Braum was that it was against Jayce as the only poke champion. There's already a Nidalee pick in here on the side of Gambit. So that's the thing you gotta look out for here. You can always block the shock blast from the Jayce, but when multiple things start hitting towards you, Braum goes a little bit down in value, but he's still great just against Betsy alone. So I like the pick in that sense. Also fantastic disengage. When Nidalee gets locked in as a jungler, and the reason I prefer Gragas in most cases is because he offers more utility. In a sense, he can be a secondary engage. He can also be disengaged. Nidalee is very one-dimensional in that sense. Late game, what you do is you land poke, and then if you see a low target, you try and jump in and execute it, otherwise you just heal and poke in the back line. So Origin right now have a Victor that's going to be very safe by the looks of it, and they have decent poke already, setting up for a fairly strong composition.
And this is the first time we're going to see Peke on that Victor DeFisher. You've talked about how you like it as a blind pick mid lane traditionally on the blue side.
I'm a fan.
I know you are. I know you are. But it also means Origin have left their top lane for counter pick. Forgiven is going to play the lose Xian. 0-11 in Europe, 0-4 in NA. In the LCS, not doing well. And of course, we will see that Shen for Cabochard in the top lane, which I'm not super excited about because I prefer seeing him on carries.
Yeah, Gambit really run the risk here of lacking damage. Lucian is so difficult to play properly in teamfights because of his very low range. And when you're against the likes of a Victor who has such a mass amount of burst from a decent range himself with the death ray in his ulti, you have to be so careful how you're moving in and out near that Victor here for himself. If Nautilus comes in as a top lane pick as well, mass amount of CC being like, where's the Lucian? Oh, you're 500 range? Yeah, I'm going to just anchor you in the face and we're going to blow you up. So Gambit right here, yes, they're trying to pick for strong lanes. Jayce can play aggressive in the laning phase. Lucian into Corki, once you get a BF sword, Lucian can really start being super annoying in that lane until the Trinity Force comes in for the Corki. But like, Gambit is really relying a lot on having a strong early laning phase for themselves, where Origin, teamfight-wise, is looking fantastic.
Both sides with slightly limited damage sources when you look at those mid lanes, but of course Gambit going to be relying on some of that poke. Nautilus top for Soez, it'll be the first time we're seeing it for him. And also, not particularly popular here in Europe. Nautilus top definitely seeing way more action in the North American LCS.
And had a small nerf here in 5.13. Just lost a little bit of damage on his Riptide, but he is still extremely strong up in that top lane because what he's bringing is obviously not his damage, that's not why you pick him. He's a massive tank with so much CC against low range targets. That's his cup of tea. That's what he wants to play against. So we need to see here. If there's a guy who can pull off a Lucian, it is Forgiven.
Yeah, but he hasn't done it.
No, yeah, true. But I'm just saying.
This is the third time that he's tried. Of the 11 losses, Forgiven has been two of them. I'm not a believer, DeFisio. We'll have to find out whether or not it can be proven right. Jump on Twitter, let us know. Hashtag GMBWin or hashtag OGWin. Origin, they're already in the playoffs. Will they get one step closer to clinching that semi-final position? Gambit want to say no. Gambit also want to break the Lucian losing streak.
Oh man, imagine if Lucian becomes a thing again. If he wins just one game, the hype. Everyone will go into solo queue and spam him. And then they realize he's still extremely difficult to pull off properly.
Wondered where you were going to go with that, DeFisio. So we are into the Rift. Diamond as well as... We are. Everybody is going for a defensive start, as our American brethren would say, the line of scrimmage.
Mm-hmm.
Heels is...
I'm not really sure what that is.
I mean, he's got a spatula in the river. We're starting off real weird today, DeFisio. I'm excited for where this is going to go.
All right, okay. So again, let's look at like what Gambit has been building here. We saw SK Gaming the last game used in Italy super effectively because they had three lanes that could play super aggressive in the start. It allowed Diamond to... Svensken to invade in. Now Diamond is obviously looking to do the same. I want to see him play around that bottom lane. So you have TP and Shen ulti to support that, and then you play around Forgiven and this Alistar to dive, and guys, please.
DeFisher is like that disappointed school teacher who's really trying to keep the kids' attention, but somebody's got a cool new hairstyle that everyone's talking about.
All right, 2v2 lanes.
All right, so we're going to watch Krugs.
We're in the Rift.
As a reminder, the last time this team played was week 5, so 3 weeks ago, and it was a very, very heavy defeat on the side of Gambit from Origin. But as we've said multiple times, Gambit continued to grow, and we'll see how that 2v2 goes. Relic Shield for Mithy once they get to lane.
Yeah. I really like Braum into melee support because it's so easy for him to connect just the first hit, start his passive going, and if goes to paper overextend, you can very easily get the stun onto him. But obviously he's running 4 potions, he's an Alistar, so he's not really the ideal target for you. Unless you walk straight into your face after tanking the Crux at level 1. So good little trade early from Mythy. He's really trying to zone away Forgiven and Ghost Pepper a little bit and give him that early level 2.
Origin do get that Forgiven and Ghost Pepper respecting a level 2, and they've immediately backed away. He's going to start throwing out those Winter's Bites and try and get the passive down.
Oh man, even production is showing it. Yeah. Everyone just making fun of Lucian.
We're going hard on Lucian. Sorry, guys. The Lucian main's out there. Maybe Forgiven can change the plan. We're in standard lanes, and we'll keep our eyes on this 2v2 matchup, as well as the farming everywhere else on the map. Diamond on track to get both buffs. We're pretty low on HP as far as gank is concerned.
For me, there's this 2v2 lane in the bottom lane. It's going to be so key for how the mid game is going to play out. Because as I mentioned before, Gambit want to use Diamond to invade in around the bottom side of the map and then have Shen ulti as a support to quickly be 5 members. Use that double global and use the Alistar once you hit level 6 to start setting up these tower dives. That's how you can play around with Lucian. For now though, Mythy, because they're pushing the bottom lane with the early level 2, it's a quick roam. Just going to spot Diamond enough.
Problem is, he's in trouble. Gambit have spotted this out. The Javelin Toss has come in. Ghost is going to look for the engage. Knock Mythy up in the air. And that's a knock back. Mythy's going to be able to stand behind me. Jump over to Amazing. Diamond's going to hop over the wall. A lot of action, but nobody goes down. Good response from Gambit.
Yeah, very early roam for Mythy. And just quickly realizing there was nothing to gain for him. Gambit managed to push their way back out so they could roam up freely. Betsy's going aggressive here on Pekka, but obviously instantly get denied by the potential stomp, but a good trade from him.
Betsy playing very aggressively, got a small advantage over Pekka. I want to look at Pekka's itemization to see how he's going to make use of those AP changes in 513, where he puts his priorities.
If he wants a Rylai's, otherwise we can still see the standard Victor. Obviously you go for double upgrade fairly early on, your E and your Q. And then from there on and out, just try and almost stack as much AP as possible. We need death caps. We have seen Morrell and Omicron a few times. I almost prefer getting CDR boots instead of the Morrell and Omicron. And then just try and aim more towards Void Staff death cap as fast as possible to maximize your damage, because you have so fantastic scaling. But obviously death cap now that it is more expensive, Void Staff as well. It's a bit harder to get there. We might see a filler item in the middle. Now Betsy, he's gonna get ganked.
Here comes Amazing. Can he find the knockup? Yes! Betsy's gonna flash away. Amazing flashes forward. First blood to Captain Pekka. Diamond wants a reply. The knockup doesn't connect there. There's a pounce from Diamond Prox. Gonna put down the heel. Looking for a follow-up. Got into the tower. Pekka, will he get the double? The minions gonna help out. 2 for 2.
2 for 2. Pekka got the kills. Diamond got the kills as well. He managed to follow with his jump when Amazing was trying to escape from it. In the end, a lot of action in the mid lane. It's not even going to be about that bottom lane yet. Pekka though, getting 2 kills. That's very key also for Origin. Get him going. He's the late game scaling for them. You got the mid game secured with the Corki pick. You need Pekka to have a great game. And we know he shows up in team fights every single game. Once he gets to team fights, he's a massive carry for Origin.
Of course, when Origin played against Fnatic last week, it was Febivin's late game victor that minced them. Multiple team fights. That Chaos Storm came down out of Febivin, and all of a sudden, Origin were just gone. We do see the most exciting tank v tank battle get more exciting.
Now, the junglers, Diamond again.
2v2. Level 6s have been secured. Cabochard's caught. Diamond's coming in from the side as Cabochard gets knocked up twice. Now they turn their attention to Diamond Prox, and Amazing got there first. They've got the kill.
Little bit of miscommunication at team level. Let's talk about that after, because the bottom lane, Mythy might look for a stun on Ghost of Paper. This is a melee matchup in terms of the supports.
It's very exciting, DeFizio.
That was about what's going to happen, but top lane here. Cabochard walked in toward the bush while Diamond just stepped away from the top lane himself. So there was a little bit of miscommunication, and Origin just instantly replies. Cabochard can obviously use his teleport with his Stand United as well, so he can still join in case something happens. Now PF Sword for Forgiven. Look to see Gambit start making some plays around that bot lane.
700 gold down as we're hitting 7 minutes. CS advantage for Betsy, taking on Pekka in that middle lane, despite the fight that took place. Ended up costing Pekka a little bit more. Vitality should be able to pick up this blue buff from Diamond. And those first back, Sheen, as well as the longsword for Niels, are going to return to lane. So now we're going to see whether or not this 2v2 gets a little more explosive, considering there's more damage from both sides. But I think the early game impact is also a change for Diamond. Because for the last 2 weeks, sure, we've been talking about how low his kill participation, how low his kills and involvement before 15 minutes was.
Yeah.
Diamond's now been all over the map in multiple fights.
Diamond, this split have turned into basically a warding bot. He is the jungler now that Kickers is gone, that has warded the most in the EULCS, and like that was his way of like, he would shadow lanes, stab his vision control, and then say, now you can just handle it on your own. You don't have to worry about being ganked because you can see everything. In this game though, when you're playing Nidalee, you have to make an impact in the early game. That's where you are the strongest. So good start for him. He's been able to follow Amazing around, but then we saw a little problem up in the top lane where Kabushka went forward when Diamond went away from the lane, and instantly Origin managed to punish him. But for now, otherwise, it is fairly even in the early game.
Second blue buff up. This one will be donated to Peke for Origin. He's already backed, picked himself up that Fiendish Codex, has Hex Core Mark 1. Diamond Prox deciding the bottom lane may be the scene of the next gank. I think he's gonna go around the river out of vision, so Origin might be in trouble. Yeah, Mythic does not have access to the Glacial Fish, and he's been knocked back. Goes to with a flash engage. Mythy, it's gonna put up the giant wall, but it is breakable. Niels, not gonna aggressively go forward. And that means it's a kill to Diamond, third of the game.
Yeah, this time it was Diamond being there first in the bottom lane. We mentioned how Gambit could stop making some plays around it. Simply just walking the river, flash Q from Ghost of Paper. Mythy could not react in time. Sadly, not a kill for the Lucian, but Diamond, I mean, he's going to be very happy with this early game from the Extreme Effect. He can go for Rite of Ages now, especially because he's going to get it so early with these three kills. It's a build we've seen before from it, and just makes it a little bit more beefy and strong in these early skirmishes.
And we saw how effective it was earlier today. That same build, Runeglaive into Roa. Some of the other items picked up, Warriors for Amazing. They go for some of the damage. An early Catalyst for Soaz's Nautilus. I'm expecting that to be Righteous Glory, despite the nerfs, and I'm hoping for it to be Roa and give us some damage.
I'm going to say Righteous Glory, but maybe. Yep. I mean, Soaz is a player who has done different things. Now, both junglers once again are going to meet each other.
This time round, it looked like Diamond started. Stand United was being channeled, but Diamond's going to run away. Soaz and Amazing in the back in the 2v2. This time, no kill.
It is still funny to see these junglers here just always trying to mirror each other. Top lane have been a lot of action, trying to snowball these tanks, which is somewhat weird, but Origin obviously is trying to play against the global instead of having a Ghost of Pepper stun and walks away. But what Origin is doing is saying, if we dive the bot lane, if we gank the bot lane, we know Kabushka can join with his ulti, so we take the fight to him, where he won't be able to use it properly. And that is what Gambit is reading as well, and they just keep facing each other up in that top lane.
Very good play from both teams' junglers. Been heavily involved in all of their team's kills, setting them up and responding. Still even on gold as we've crested 11 minutes. This 2v2 to Fischo still even, despite the fact that Diamond came in for a successful gank. We've seen Phage picked up, Pickaxe picked up. So actually both AD carries on track for a pretty solid mid game. Yeah. No clear advantage.
No, very even between them. We mentioned the Braum into melee supports and also the early start for Origin. Amazing, showing himself mid lane, not a gank. That's why Diamond is not here, guys. Otherwise, of course, he would have been ready. And instead, I want to see what else Diamond wants to build. Cooldown reduction boots for himself. Going in heavily towards his poke build. Less cooldown on your spear, less cooldown on your heal. That's going to be the key ones. And Origin will need ways to start fights against Betsy, because they only have Niels to respond themselves. But then once you have these big 5-on-5 team fights, it's going to be so much about what Pick can do on this Victor.
If given enough time, Victors can do a lot. But Gambit are not necessarily going to be super clumped up. Jace, Nidalee, want to spam from afar. For Given, only really wants to close in once people start going low.
Pick is running with their magic penetration boots, so he wants to be a little bit more impact here in the early to mid game. I assume then he's going to finish the into Morel Nomicon for the cooldown reduction, which you need. So he's going to delay his core late game items a little bit, but he's going to be stronger right now at this given time. And that's obviously where Origin likes to really shine in the mid game. And now Soas is in trouble.
Diamond and Cabo are jumping on. There's going to be the Void Rush. Amazing's come in. He's knocked up Cabo's shot. Soas still trying to get away. Chilling Smite is down. That's a shock blast from the side. Betsy's found Soas. Hammer goes down on Amazing. With the help of the tower, double kill for Betsy.
Betsy roamed early because it was Gambit starting the gank, so they could set it up in advance and say, Betsy, start moving in case we need you. He flashed Shock Blast onto Source, but his mid lane, or his mid tower might go down, fighting the bottom lane as well, Trevor.
Breakable comes MTP. Out. Teleport's coming down from Cabochard, not using Stand United. Velk away from Niels as Mithy needs to put down the Glacial Fissure. He won't even get a chance. And Gambit, 6-3.
Gambit might have lost the mid tower, but getting two kills top and that opened up Cabochard to finally make a play on the bottom lane. The Source was gone now. Instant reaction. Origin fighting, even though they knew there was a chance of a Shen join. Look at this here. Betsy's already moving because Gambit is communicating. We're going to gank top. The last few times Amazing was there, if you start moving now, we will be able to collapse 3v2 at least. He's going to flash and then Shock Blast onto Source. One kill, gets the second one. Mid tower was already fairly low from him. And then right now, the bot lane of Origin just have to be careful. They have to be like, okay, there's global. He can freely just TP down. Let's not engage in anything or risk getting engaged on. Not what happened. That's why Gambit got another kill for themselves.
So Gambit have a small gold lead with the kill advantage and the CS advantage. Small ones they've got. But I want to mention that for Origin, that tower, that is their 11th first tower of the split in 15 games. Origin are pretty good. For contrast, they've also got 10 first dragons throughout their 15 games. Dragons still available, might be able to increase the amount of vision that Gambit have put around the objective for the time being. Neither team's going to have an easy task of securing this one.
A few pink wards, though, around the dragon itself. Only one place by Gambit. So this is more, we're going to secure vision to see if you started and also of the spot certain ganks, but we're not really stopping you by any means from doing it. Origin are setting up themselves. You can see all the ping wards have been invested on the top side because there's been so many ganks around these top laners. And Origin starting it, Diamond and Betsy are going to go say, you take dragon, we take Soas.
And hopefully the tower, if you're a Gambit fan. Diamond's coming from behind, there's no flash. Size is going to at least put that dredge line depth charge down. So they're going to keep being chased. Red buff is ticking. The great chase continues. A second dredge line. Soas has escaped. There's a Void Rush up top with Gambit looking for the kill. Have they given up the tower? No, they should still be able to secure this. And
so
they will.
Again for Gambit here. They try and play around Cabochard to open him up so he can TP down to the bottom lane in case they need him. By always forcing Soas away, now in this case trading for the dragon, Gambit try and snowball the game at least in terms of gold. Origin more investing towards the late game with that early dragon pickup for themselves. But still, very interesting to see how even on a tank, Cabochard is the focus for Diamond so often. If he gets ahead, he is the main carry on this team. Even though Forgiven is there, even though Betsy is there, Cabochard is the main carry.
And that's kind of Gambit's team identity.
It is.
When you look at how Gambit plays, their play styles and their team compositions, it's predominantly built around Cabochard. And that's not what we were expecting coming into the split. We were expecting more of a focus to be on Forgiven. And the person that gives up most of the farm, gives up most of the gold and resources, tends to be Betsy in these circumstances.
Right. We obviously got to highlight the fact that it's been a very top lane focused meta. It's not been about the AD carries. It's something Forgiven has been very vocal about, how people should not expect the same player they saw for SK Gaming in the last split because the meta changed. It's no longer Lucian Graves, win your lane, win the game. Cinderhold, the big tanks and so on made Graves nearly impossible to play. Lucian with the low range, too many CCs that could catch him in fights. So it's not about the AD carry anymore. And that's obviously why Forgiven doesn't have the same impact. However, I still feel like he's doing a lot with what he's getting. He's the one that AD carries doing the most damage in the LCS. He gets a lot of farm always, even though he's not getting ganks from Diamond. He's always securing farm or at least going even in his laning phase. And that's where Forgiven has been strong, even though it's not been about him. So they know they have a carry in Forgiven, but it's still about Capo Shot mainly.
Forgiven's going to have to step up to break the 0 and 11 losing streak Lucian had set. We did see an attempted gank from Diamond, albeit not particularly heavily invested. We're just trying to save that bottom outer tower. And while all that is going on, we still continue to farm. So we're comfortably in the mid game. Will be shortly, I should say. Gambit are the ones that hold a 2,000 gold lead. They're down a dragon, but they're ahead in kills.
And Gambit is the team that wants to keep the laning phase going. They're the team who wants to keep split pushing almost all game long in this case, because that's where you can utilize the Shin ulti effectively. If you can take a cross-map objective and have Stan United join in as well, when you have an Alistar to start dives and a Nidalee to skirmish, you want to play this spread-out game. Origin is the team who wants to 5-on-5 teamfight, so this is not in favor of Origin. And that's also why Gambit are happy to continue the laning phase. They're just waiting for that one opening where Capuchin can TP down to the bottom lane on the Alistar, and you just dive whoever is there, or you take the tower for free.
Betsy, this time we'll be looking to poke out Mithy. There's no support from the rest of Origin. And I'd like to draw your attention to some itemization, DeFicio. Diamond did not go for the Roa, instead built the Abyssal Scepter second item. And Pekka's picked himself up a Nidalee Large Rod as opposed to finishing that Morella Nomicon. So options on both sides.
Right. So obviously for Pekka, it's because he had the 1,250 gold or say around that mark here, so he could get the large rod for himself. It's very standard when you go back and you see how much gold you have. Can you get a big item, or do you just want to finish the current one you're building towards? Now, also with Morella Nomicon having a fairly easy build path. However, the diamond build here, this is something he likes to do. I know a lot of people really hate Skirmisher Saber on Nidalee, but with Runeglaive as well, and Diamond, he's playing a very in-your-face style. The Abyssal Scepter against so much magic damage on the side of Origin, Corki, Victor, Nautilus, allows him to play super aggressive in fights here and always try and jump in one-on-one. But it obviously does hurt him a little bit in terms of poke because of his mana pool being so small. And that's where we see a difference between how other people play Nidalee and how Diamond likes to play.
This game, it's working out. 20 minutes is up, 2 towers to 1. Gambit have been the ones dictating the tempo of the game. We saw them push bottom outer tower. We saw them sieging the middle tower, and Origin are now being pulled into question. Origin has to dig a little deeper. They're playing from behind a little bit, and they are the ones that have to bounce back.
Yeah, Origin as a team, when they don't win the mid game, which is normally the strongest point for Origin, tend to collapse. And it's how a team like Rocket managed to beat them early in the split, where they shut them down in the mid game with the roams. They like went for Mithy and Amazing every time. That stopped Origin from ever setting up their own 1-3-1 setup, or their own push out the waves and then group together and like get maximum farm on your carries. They couldn't do that because of it, and they got shut down. Gambit are looking to do the same again. We still split up in lanes. Diamond is chasing.
Diamond's chasing. Down. Pounce. Diamond's gonna pounce. Dredge Lion comes out, he's gonna pounce some more, one more! So as sidesteps, Diamond's looking for the Runeglaive auto. It's not gonna be enough, the shield comes up, Stan United will save Diamond Prox's life. Diamond really wanted that kill.
We've hit the point though where it's no longer worth keep ganking for this Shen. Bot lane tower went down because Origin knew there were two guys off top lane fighting against Sora, so they lost the bot lane tower for this one kill. Not worth it for Gambit.
Pekka has just been hit by that shock blast. Rest of Gambit gonna siege now this middle tower. Despite losing bottom, can they equal it out? Short answer will be no. Those who are Mithy trading. So Dragon number 2 might go the way of Origin. And DeFicio mentioned the gold lead and how Origin collapsed. The 3 games they've been behind at 20 minutes, they've lost.
This was a good trade, though, for Origin. Got the second Dragon, so they might play towards number 5. Got a bot lane tower as well, just by losing your top laner. And again, as I mentioned, that's where Gambit needs to use the Shen now to set up plays elsewhere on the map. Don't keep going for swords over and over, especially when there's no tower to gain from it. The mid lane was super low. That would have been such an easy dive for Gambit to go for. Stan United, Nidalee, and Betsy together. That tower is either going to die, or if Pekka stays around, you just tower dive him and kill him. Like, it was basically other options for Gambit?
Well, if there was ever any signal that Gambit were not looking for more than just comfortable farming, it's the fact that Forgiven still not purchased boots. 22 and a half minutes in, Phantom Dancer completed, Eye Edge completed, he's gaining power. Needlessly large rod and cloth armor for Diamond, so he might be going for Hourglass. Gonna further enforce that playstyle.
Yeah, just in
he's
your face.
He's a melee cougar form assassin.
We're gonna see him jump in and try and get to Nils and Pekka in these fights here.
Hey,
he's building defensively. Early Baron being started down the bottom lane. We got a split with some copper shot.
There is a teleport, but no Stand United.
Origin, Sorcerer's recall. There's a ping ward here, so they haven't spotted it yet. Sorcerer's TP, Mithy's far away. That's a super early and
ladies
quick
and gentlemen.
Baron.
Gambit have been scrimming Fnatic, a 22 and a half minute Baron. That was as safe can be.
And so much control around the top side from Gambit allowed them to have these pink wards for a while in the river. Origin just clearly not expecting that rush onto the Baron.
Let me see if I remember your wording. If Origin fall behind in the mid game, they collapse? Was that the terminology? Cabochard's gonna dash away. Has a flash, but not even gonna need it. And while Pekka shows bottom, Betsy secures the last outer tower. Diamond looking for more. Mithy's gonna put down the Glacial Fissure and Nils looking for a kill. Stand United comes out and here comes Gosu. Doesn't get the pulverize. Headbutt's gonna be available, but flashes burn to escape. And Origin, with their tails between their legs, get out alive.
That's what I like to see here from Gambit. You play away from the Shen so you can use his global properly. And Origin is like, yeah, we try and force a fight.
Oops.
Instant Shen is there. That's for more attack damage on the tower, Trevor, obviously. Or Mistlick, but...
I prefer option number one. But Deficio, despite all the changes in 513, despite AP getting a rework, I didn't quite expect Pekka to still be sitting on, well, nothing.
Building a bit of everything for himself, but then... So he goes back, he's like, okay, I got 1300 gold, okay, large rod for myself. Okay, next time I go back, oh, I only got like, what, 800 now. Blasting one, fine, 850. I have to change 10 gold cheaper, thank you. Now finally completed. So he was building towards his death cap for a while and now towards the Morel Normicon. So he had like two items in mind. Always just didn't have enough gold to fully complete it. It is what we see though, still on these Victor builds. It's about getting as much AP as possible because again, your scaling is fantastic.
Baron secured, as we mentioned a few minutes ago. All the items are now starting to stack up. And almost every member of Gambit has got pink wards in their inventory.
Well, you got a death cap now, and when you have a hat on, you kill people.
That looked like it hurt. No hourglass for Diamond means he just gets two shots by Pekka. Pekka did use his flash for that. And that will at least slow down some of this Baron push. But Gambit have got their split push threats. Threats, maybe not the right word. Their split push tool in this Shen.
Yeah.
And he's already starting to try and control those side lanes. You can see Betsy down bottom as well.
And with Gambit having the map control and being the proactive team for a lot of the game here, what we have to remember, when you have two guys who need to teleport away from the lane, the proactive team is always easier to coordinate it and have the first TP coming because you're the guy calling, okay, we're going to dive bot lane, move back and start TPing. So you might always get like 1 or 2 seconds ahead of the enemy team, and that can be enough to lock down a target with so many squishy members on both sides to get that one kill.
And of course, with all the damage that Diamond's putting out, he's currently dealing 3 times the amount of damage that Amazing has put out on the map. Despite the fact that Amazing is on Rek'Sai and has that warrior enchant, just hasn't been able to have the same level of impact or pressure Diamond's currently exerting.
Well, Amazing with the Warren Chant, clearly trying to match, obviously, the mid lane, the early game. That's why we see more and more for junglers now. I mean, some of the Cinderhulk tanks have been nerfed, probably Rek'Sai is one of them. So we start seeing like Lee Sin come back quite a lot. We've seen Nidalee now with Runeclave, and that also means some of the junglers like Rek'Sai might go Warren Chant more often to match the early game. I feel like Amazing had a fine start to the game, but the problem was when Gambit has a second global, it becomes more difficult, and Origin is engaged in some, in my opinion, fairly poor fights or skirmishes.
And that's where that one unbreakable shield versus multiple forms of poke becomes slightly less effective. Unbreakable times out and that accelerated shock blast then comes out.
But Given needs to be careful. He's standing in a bush with a warden. I'm sure he's expecting it. So if he's standing there trying to hope for someone to step forward, he might just be caught himself.
It's backed away. So this time around, nothing ventured, nothing gained. Vision relatively deep on the side of Origin, and we can see Cabochard plus Diamond move their way up to the middle lane. Shock Blast does not connect with anybody. And we see Gambit didn't really have the numbers or the minions really to get on that mid inner turret. So the first siege has fallen a little less effective.
Gambit a poke, but they don't really have a whole lot of siege in itself to hit the tower. The 500 range Lucian, no thank you. That's just the way of dying and continuing that losing streak. Instead, again, you want to land the poke before these objectives, and you want to try and create the numbers advantage with the Shimmer. That's not going to happen now because there's five members from Origin, but the fight is on.
Gravity Field's going to block the entry into the jungle, not going to stop Gosu. The first frag will be secured onto Soaz as Lucian gets it. Dragon focused down by Gambit, and they accelerate their lead. 7,000 gold. They win the fight, and they peel for tower.
And just look at the setup here from Gambit, coming from two different sides, landing poke, and then it goes to Pepper walking into the choke point with a Shen ulti on. If you're Nils or Pekka, you're never gonna walk close to that because the Shen taunt can just get you. Amazing might even go down.
Amazing's gonna be able to tunnel away. Hourglass comes out, Chaos Storm may be enough. Diamond Prox manages to pounce away as Betsy is focused out by Nils and Pekka. It's so far a 2-for-2 as the flash taunt from Cabo keeps Nils in place, and Earth is trying to get away. Gambit, siege down another tower. Nils is doing the best he can to wave clear, and it will be enough this time around. Homeguard comes out for Soaz. He's looking for the dredge line. Holding the trigger, connects onto a minion. He's gonna flash forward to bonk for Given on the head, and Nils gets the kill credit.
All right, Origin responding in the end here, but Gambit won the first team fight. Baron is not alive. Best Origin might be able to do is this top tower, potentially the blue buff, but I think Diamond just took that one away, so. It's not there yet, boys. Need another 40 seconds.
You time it from time Gambit secured it. So this is the dive and team fight.
Right, so after the one team fight from Gambit, they're going for another dive. Obviously with the tower on Diamond at first, so he's out of it now. Nice stun from Pekka, secures at least one kill for Nils. And now it's just like buy time. Just wait for Soaz to respawn. I believe he even TP's into the tower and responds at least getting one kill for himself. But it's still Gambit in control. They're the ones starting the fight, they're the ones coordinating when to go in, when to back away, and they're controlling the choke points, which is so key for them. Whenever you have a Shen, even an Alistar as well, these carries here can never walk into a choke point because of the flash pulverize from the Shen taunt. Like, there's so many ways to catch multiple guys if Origin group up, and that becomes tricky for them when they're behind now.
Origin splits up. Peck is so far away, but Gambit appealed. That's a two-man taunt, and Diamond plus Forgiven have already dropped Miffy. Glacial Fisher did not even come out. Diamond tosses a javelin, and that's two quick kills.
Why was Peck down the bottom lane? I guess he was trying to take a blue buff and then realized Gambit just already started the Baron. He's here now. Can Origin do anything to stop it? Cabochard's TPing in.
Cabochard's looking for a target. He's called Pekka! The culling culls him! Diamond manages to get the kill. Gambit back away. Fisher not used. Chaos Storm not used. Origin are out of sorts.
That's the thing we didn't highlight in the start. Pekka is running with Ignite, so a very aggressive summoner. Didn't get to use it in the laning phase, and instead, the lack of cleanse against the Shen becomes super, super important in the late game.
Nils manages to get a kill onto Gosu, but it is nothing but consolation as Gambit get the Baron. And that's the second time this game. We're 31 minutes in.
Gambit, every week, slowly getting better and better and better. And it's not even like we can say, okay, Gambit, no, this is like crazy play style. Like back in the spring, it was pure 5-on-5 team fight for Gambit. No, to me, they've turned into a fairly standard team, just with a lot of focus on the top lane as the only real standout thing. And that's a great thing for Gambit. It shows they have improved, it shows the shot calling is getting better for them and how to play off the map, and the pick and ban phase as well is changing. It used to be, what on earth is going on? Getting better and better for Gambit. This one is obviously very physical focused for both Jace and Lucian. So you gotta worry if you go full late game against double tank.
I believe in the Diamond AP, Bruiser, Cougar Form Assassin build.
Don't really like the Haunting guys right now for it, though.
We'll find out on the next episode of Diamond Jumps Into a Team Fight. But what a great split for Gambit. Because in summer, they were somewhat out of sorts. And fell at the first hurdle in the quarterfinals of the playoffs, but they made playoffs. We said at the beginning of this matchup, Shawns went on record and said, if we do not make playoffs, this season is a failure. That is a very, very harsh sentiment.
It is.
But it is one that may not come to pass because Gambit, again, are looking great.
And look at that schedule. We mentioned how Gambit as a team, because they're facing some of two of the guys around them in the standings, I believe they have the Unicorns of Love tomorrow. Like, those were the key games for Gambit to win, and Elements next week. Origin were not one of the games where you're saying, okay, they're going to win that one, and then they're going to be here in the standings. It is still an upset if Origin lose to a team under them in the standings. But this is just great play from Gambit overall, and so key for that playoff race.
What a way to win. From early lane ganks that Diamond put into play after all of the critics talking about his first 15-minute game impact, me being one of them. Gambit using those Baron-empowered minions for at least another minute or so to siege up. Peke takes a shock blast to the face. Unbreakable's up will block some of the damage, but Betsy, just rinse and repeat. You can't block everything, Mithy. Origin starting to fall to pieces, but this is the one area where we can say somewhat expected. Gambit's ability to take towers while the towers are being defended,
right,
not the greatest. Oh. It has to be through split push. It has to be through dives or through kills.
Yeah. Land a mass amount of poke, enable a dive from that. If you don't manage to do it, you just back away and you try and work around each objectives and you try and force Origin out of their base. Peke is running full offense. Summoners, build. Kaposhite is going to look for him in every single team fight, and it's going to be fairly simple for him to target him out. Because again, Gambit have been in control of the map. Look at the vision around the next dragon. If Origin wants to contest it, they're walking through a jungle that is owned by Gambit. So they can't do it. They have to just give it up. Say, stop playing around. Maybe an overextension from Gambit if they like tower dive where they shouldn't. But you then have this Alistar, which makes it so risk-free to go for some of these dives. We still need to see what's going to happen if Origin can keep stacking armor. Lucian Jace, that is the damage dealers on Gambit. The magic damage of a Shen doesn't really count in the late game. Then it's only about Diamond. So we see Mithy, Frozen Heart coming in soon. Frozen Heart already for Swords, Randuin's for Amazing, so they have tanks. Problem is the damage dealers are dying. They're getting caught out, they have no way of defending themselves, and that's where Gambit can always just win the fights.
Diamond's doing a great job of distracting Origin, which is enabling Kaboshot or Gosu to get that CC down. 35 minutes gone, 14 to 18 kills. That dragon was just secured a moment ago by Gambit, which evens it at 2 apiece. And with Stand United available, teleport shortly. Kaboshot's up top. Gambit go back to the rinse and repeat style. That's a giant cow! Not gonna find Peke. El Toro has to back away. Whoa! Peke almost got killed. Or was that about not having enough damage to Fischio?
Well, I mean, against Peke, the guy with no defensive items, it doesn't really count, does it? I think Forgiven expected to get the last auto off with the flash, but didn't get it. Instead, we just go to the top lane.
Soez has to flash away before using that depth charge. Three members of Gambit continuing to siege the accelerated shock boss. Chunks out Amazing. Wave clears going low. Niels is taking a duel with Forgiven. It's not going to work out. That is a giant cow. The Ignite pulverize. Gosu taxis through a minion and takes Niels out. Stand United's coming down from Kaboshot. Gosu's looking for more. Unbreakable has been used. Gambit have cracked open the base. Forgiven will start hammering away onto the inhibitor. And Surz will do what he can. Diamond lands the javelin. Gonna start chunking away with that haunting, guys. Goes golden. Gosu's in trouble without Unbreakable Will. And the Fissure does nothing. Gambit have already started to back away as Diamond, I lie, gets slowed by the Fissure before he tastes Mithy. Taunt is sidestepped by Amazing. But inhibitors down. Betsy soloed Peke. A little bit of help from Gosu. And now Gambit, they're going to be pushing. They're pushing for the win. That's a flash double taunt. Works out. Kaboshot catches onto the kill on Soez and Gambit. Take down the first
Lucian
Nexus
Hive.
Turret. Lucian looks to be picking up the first win of the summer split.
Not yet.
Oh, I'm getting too excited. 18 to 10 in kills. Culling's going out, but Niels has got the reach end of the fountain. Deficio. Gambit are backing away. It's not done yet.
Go back. Wait for Baron to respawn. Force a fight around it or just take it for free and then you can go in. I mean, you don't even need that Baron if it is. You got double super minions coming for yourself. You are still very, very far ahead in this game. And Gambit really been in control in the mid game. Orange didn't manage to get the lead from it. And they've just been behind in every fight so far.
Exceptional play from Gambit.
Gambit doesn't even have a locket against so much AP, but like...
Who's gonna buy a locket with all that engage? This is that one...
Ghost of Paper could have gone for it and delayed one of his other items if he wanted to. But yeah, you don't build it on... That's one of the things about Nidalee. You don't build locket on her, typically. So you gotta get it somewhere else. Shen could maybe have gone for it, but he's pushing most of the time.
BF Sword Shen.
I mean, why?
Go on, Cabochon. Why not? Gambit set up for the Baron, as you mentioned. It would be the third of the game. A lot of items. I mean, look at Gosu with Nomad's Medallion, the coin rather, as well as Righteous Glory. He can run down whoever he wants to.
Yeah.
Miffy will be the target. Glacial Fissure comes out. Soez is going to connect with a little dredge line. And Miffy chunked so low from that Javelin Toss. Soez already has to retreat. Gosu still unhurt on the front line. The giant cow walking through Origin's front lines. The ninth kill of the game for Diamond. The base going to get focused down. Flashes from Gambit. They want to end the game right now. They want to end the Lucian losing streak. Gambit have got super minions pushing towards them. One Nexus turret stands between them and a victory. Gambit look to be crushing the league's number two team. Finish so I can have a win moment.
We need Lucian to win a game.
It's going to happen. The turret's being focused.
Watch out,
Gambit are going to tie fourth place and are one step closer to the playoffs.
Lucian is back.
Phenomenal play from Gambit.
I was sitting all week being like, okay, which teams you really want to look at? Gambit was one of them because of the way they keep getting better and better. And then they had this loss last week to Giants where they were like almost broken from it, being like, oh, this could have been, or this potentially could have been the game we had to win to make playoffs because now we have Origin and so on. And now they come back this week. Fantastic performance. Composition-wise, yes, okay, you're running double physical damage deal. It can be very, very risky. But for them, because they got such a big lead in the mid-game, they can always get to the carries as well, or zone out the carries. They could take down these tanks on the side of Gambit and Lucian. I mean...
Teficio. Lucian no more. 1-11 in Europe. 1-15 across NA and EU. We saw some broken faces there on the side of Origin. And while we've talked extensively about Gambit winning and now they're one step close to guaranteeing playoffs, this gives us even more interest because for Amazing and for Origin, they are now tied with H2K at 10-5. They do currently own the head-to-head 1-0 because they beat H2K in week one. I'm going to disregard that. I say that doesn't count. And the reason it's so exciting, Origin and H2K play next week. Gambit also plays H2K in the same week.
Oh.
So the battle for second place, the battle...
That's where Fnatic is looking to keep their record-breaking undefeated streak alive. And well, Fnatic 14-0, that's what they brought it to last week around. Not flawless though in the games versus H2K and OG, down 4.7k on a maximum versus H2K, down 6.8k gold versus OG, but in their defense, what a stellar way to come back in those games as well.
Yeah, and I even read some comments from Fnatic and talking about how being down in those games shows how Fnatic are growing in a mentality state and how they've got this strong mentality factor now for them that they can fall behind like that. And, you know, fall behind in the early game and have it not mean the end of the game. Certainly a very strong performance to come back in both of those games.
Yeah, I don't want to look too far ahead, but obviously whatever we think of when we think of Fnatic is how they might do on the world stage. I don't know if the falling behind here might be a telling tale and that, of course, better or other teams might punish that. And I don't even think they should think that way because now they have the chance to work on it.
Right, and that is a big thing that Fnatic, I don't want to say have to fix, because part of me feels like maybe they took just half a foot off the gas. Just they know they've already locked in first place. That's not to say that they're not trying to win. It's saying that maybe they're trying a couple of different things in maybe how they're looking at planning out strategy, that kind of thing throughout the games. I still feel like Fnatic are on track for the 18-0. I wouldn't be too worried if you're a Fnatic fan from last week with regards to at least the EU LCS and the summer split.
Yeah, definitely not. Yet all teams are trying to give them their first loss, and the next contender here is Rocket, who are trying to fight to stay in playoff contention. They have beaten Origin and H2K before, so they have shown that they have what it takes when it comes to beating those top-tier teams.
They have, and honestly, they're one of the only teams that has really played spoiler. They defeated Origin before, they've beaten H2K. I believe they're the only real bottom half of the table team to have even had that feat. So, you know, they've had some tough matchups, but honestly, I feel like they're faring pretty decently. And when you look at the remaining schedule, up until today, I would have said this was a very difficult schedule with regards to Origin and Giants, but Giants and Origin both looked off their game today. I don't think this is quite as tough a schedule for Rocket anymore. As long as they show up with a half-decent strategy, they may be in for a good playoff spot.
Yeah, because we were looking at the team and who had stepped up specifically, but honestly, all the individuals and the teamwork has been paying off for them. Though I do want to mention NukeDog, because he is someone that we're always scrutinizing and while keeping a very close eye on. He has been stepping up the last couple of weeks. A KDA of 3 in weeks 1-4 to a KDA of 8 in weeks 5-7. That VARs, that has been working wonders for them. And I think he is kind of the exemplification of Rocket as a whole doing better.
Certainly. And it's kind of evolved to not just be the Varus. In the last week, we saw him mixing in a couple of other champions into the mix, making sure he was putting up good performances. So Rocket, they have a good platform right now to build themselves into playoffs, but this is going to be their toughest test of the split so far.
We'll see good team play and good individual play. And now for an expert look at how one member of Rocket really brought their A-game to the playoff race last week, we're going to hand it over to Kreppo and his snazzy spectacles. Oh, he's not wearing them.
Yeah, I forgot my spectacles, Shocks, backstage, so it's going out without them this time. But yeah, I just wanted to highlight one of the fancy plays that H2K against Rocket last week kind of ended up happening. And the man to watch is Vander in that clip. We can get the clip on your screen behind me as soon as we can. And the replay starts pause because this is a situation that always happens when H2K plays. Strategically, they are now ahead of Rocket. Rocket is about to get dove in the bottom lane tower, so they need to make something happen to even that out. And we can roll the clip right now. Pay attention, top left corner. Teleport from Oduamna comes in too far, should have been on a minion. This forces him to flash. Obviously, Mr. Owl is going to go down, but Steve forces Kasing back. And then now watching Vander, his first hook is going to connect with Oduamna, who has no flash anymore. Good target prioritization from Vander. And now this play is 1-1. You think, yeah, why are we analyzing this? Because this is going to happen next. Vander now in an offensive mindset because he knows his jungle is backing up. He's going to flash flay Hjarnen, who obviously can't spell shield that in time. He's going to chase Hjarnen. Hjarnen still has flash at this point. You have to realize that. And so does Vander, because the hook he's about to cast is going to Lulex and not to Hjarnen. He's baiting the spell shield. He's baiting H2K. He's completely mind-gaming everybody involved. And we can roll the clip right now. If you see the hook connect, it goes to Lulex instead. He gets dragged in. So in this 3v3, Rocket is winning out. And this offensive mindset now switches to a defensive mindset as Lantern comes out. Even though Jankos flashes out, the distance created by Vander is enough because Ryu is coming in. Watch Vander. Steps into the Shock Blast. Doesn't let the AoE kill off his teammate. Then flays Jace out of the jump. No hammer time right here. And then goes in for another hook, forcing another summoner spell right here on Kasing. So that's three consecutive hooks. A good flay. Positioning in those offensive, defensive mindset switches that were so key for Rocket to come back into this game. And this is something very often they have to do, Rocket. Claw out of their deficit using their mechanics. But so far, they've been growing as a team and they might be able to upset Fnatic in their next match, but obviously to see that we'll have to go to the casters who are going to run us through the lineups. Fnatic against Rocket.
Thank you so much, Kreppo. Exceptional play from Vander. Last year, his Thresh, there was whispers from some people calling him Vanderlife. It's been a long time since then.
Pretty cool people who called him that, by the way.
Yeah. Let's take a look at the rest of the lineup for Rocket, who are on the blue side with one of the most yelled top laners' names, Steve, Jankos, NukeDuck, Mr. Arles, Vander, and Yamato Cannon.
And of course, we have Fnatic as well on the red side here. Hoodie in the top lane, Rain over in the jungle. We have Febivan as the mid laner, Reckless the AD carry, Yellow Star support. They lost the coach. And Hoodie versus Steve, can it get any better?
I don't think that it can.
Vanderlife versus Yellow Star.
The audience will have to be yelling. We're going to jump into picks and bans in a moment. Deficio, what is the most important?
I've noticed that Fnatic likes to really ban out the bot lane. Okay. We just saw a Thresh play here from Vander. Could be very likely be the ban. Maybe an Alistar, maybe a Sivir. Something Fnatic have done time and time again. And it's unfair, because how do you then beat Reckless and Yellowstar if you don't even get your comfort picks?
Rocket will have to answer that
maybe
question.
Maybe Lucian.
If you look at the bans from the last time these teams met, it wasn't Alistar targeted towards Vander. Kalista as well. Of course, Lulu, a little more focused towards Nukeduck. First champion is Jace, taken off the table. Nukeduck, in my opinion, has performed better on Varus than most other champions.
I agree.
We'll see if he wants to run it again.
If Fnatic allows him to run it,
they can't, because
be
you said there's two support bans.
Okay, maybe. We'll see. We'll see. I mean, Sivir, one for one so far. I don't think they necessarily have to ban the two supports, or Varus could be one. It's a ban I would use against Nukeduck. I think Rocket has really managed to play around him the last few weeks, and because we're now in a poke meta, mid lane has more power, especially in the mid game, transitioning towards the late game on like Varus and Jace, and it's something Rocket has used so effectively. I'm already gone, there's not even a support ban, unless Vander plays Ryze.
We come up in a few seconds time to Fischio. Power picks, we should say. We knew that the theoretical AP cap of Ryze was higher, despite his tankiness being lower with some of the Rod of Ages changes. Bibbivin's going to lose Victor. This is the champion that helped Fnatic beat Origin, maintain their undefeated streak at 14-0.
It's been a while since we have seen teams try and target Bibbivin in the pick and ban phase. He normally has a very big champion pool, but that was also when he played all the assassins like LeBlanc and Zed. They're obviously not in the meta anymore. So now teams Rocket are looking towards him. Reignover has received zero bans. Fnatic adapting as well, saying we know Nukeduck is a fantastic Azir player. Don't want to risk him getting that one early on, so they ban it away. So a lot of mid lane focus suddenly. Reignover can pick whatever he wants, even though Mr. Ryle is in the feature. He's talking about how, you know, just make sure Reignover is not on Gragas or Rek'Sai. That is a failure from Rocket. And by the way, in case you haven't noticed, Huni has been spamming Riven in solo queue. Obviously been a great pick over in Korea. We've seen it a lot of times, honestly. Fantastic snowball pick.
Into the Rumble especially.
Yeah, such a good matchup for the Riven. Early rotation, I don't think is necessary for him, but I wouldn't be surprised to see if he picked the Riven.
So Steve did first pick that Rumble, not only to steal it away from Huni, but also because if we know just how powerful it is on 513 with the Liandry's changes, you can rush that, synergizes with the Rylai Scepter so well. Reckless gonna opt for Corki, considering Kalista and Sivir were both taken off the table. And Reignover's Rek'Sai once more.
Very standard first rotation for Fnatic. I think Rek'Sai is the number one pick for Reignover because he uses the global so effectively and with the Tremor Sense as well, to give so much more information to the team. Caitlyn, though, for Mr. Ryle. So we are looking for a very, very strong laning phase for Rocket here. And one of the ways teams have beaten Fnatic in the early game is through standard lanes. Fnatic is a team that control minion waves so insanely well. They know exactly when to start objectives, when to rotate away from lanes and let them slow push and like put that pressure from you through the minions. So you need standard lanes and don't try and fool around in a lane swap against them, which is also one of the reasons a Riven pick could be extremely strong for Huni, because you don't really want to one-on-one it. But if you feel like that's your only strategy versus Fnatic, what do you do?
Pick a different strategy.
But Riven.
For Fnatic, they've got to decide who they run in this middle lane.
That's a man who's going to play Riven, by the
way. Bebevin's champion pool's not been tested this hard in summer. 4 seconds left on the clock. It is locked in. The Riven for Huni. And the Alistar for Yellowstar.
So when we have seen it very often in Korea, especially in this matchup, you go for an early Hex Stringer, you go towards that Brutalizer there, Hydra, and you just have fast push and you have so much burst in these one-on-one lanes, the Rumble simply cannot do anything. However, Riven is weak in a lane swap. Now the lane swaps are very quick though, and teams have figured out how to get farm on top lane by letting them stay in the lane, get the tower. When the wave pushes back, Fnatic should be able to play around it. But Rocket really needs to decide. They got the Varus pick for Nukeduck, that's key. It's very, very important. Also why the Rumble pick is such an important one as well for the AP top. But Rocket really looking to siege towers. They won't have the range problem we saw with Illusion for Gambit last game, no. Poke from the Virus, you got fantastic long range from the Caitlyn, and you got disengage from Gragas and Janna, so it's a very, very strong siege composition for Rocket. But one thing that can ruin the day of a siege comp is a split-pushing monster like Riven, who will destroy your Rumble in the one-on-one, especially later on in the game, and then force you to always have to send someone back to defend that wave, but nobody can really hold him, and like you don't manage to establish your 5v5 siege or your group siege. That's why Rumble always falls apart. Like, he's a team fighter, he's not a split pusher.
So we'll find out whether or not Huni can get far enough ahead to make that a reality for Fnatic.
Can I just log in some wave clear right here? To hold off for the rest of the team, that's a perfect one right there. You got Corki TF as the wave clear. You have potential 1-3-1 setup if you get a lead in the early to mid game to start pushing in multiple lanes where Rocket will have no answers in the side lanes to TF and to the Riven. At the same time, you get the wave clear needed, pick potential, you can assist the Riven. Fnatic,
Officio.
I like your composition.
But you also like Rocket's composition.
I also like the siege comp they're building. I think Caitlyn is always a risk. If she doesn't get to be a bully in the laning phase, I think she's way too weak in the mid game. But I can definitely see what Rocket is going for here. I just think as long as Huni is not 0-20 by minute 5, he will have such a big impact that it can become a big problem for Rocket.
More excitement. First time TF for Febiven. First time Riven in summer in Europe in the hands of Huni. And a first time Caitlyn for Mr. Rawls.
Not too exciting.
It's that was a little less exciting.
Yeah, it's Caitlyn. Like.
But we need to see whether or not Caitlyn and Janna can put the pressure Rocket need in this game. Fnatic are looking to go 15-0, undefeated after 8 weeks of games.
Rocket is looking to make us believe again, and then maybe disappoint us tomorrow, which is what they've been doing all split long. Great game, bad game, great game, bad game. They need a great game to beat Fnatic, that's for sure.
Hashtag ROC win if you think they will have that great game, or hashtag FNC win. Will Fnatic remain undefeated in the summer splits with Riven in the hands of Huni?
So, nobody cares about Riven. Twisted Fate, however, into poke compositions is so nice.
It definitely is, Deficio. We see the teams leaving their bases, most likely for this defensive start. And let's actually go back to last week and hear from Rainover talking about Fnatic's early game.
Like, usually, if you want to get early ahead, you should take some risk. There must be some risk, but we don't really want to take risk to get ahead. We try to fight when our power spike is. So, like, if we don't really find a reason to fight when we have no power spike, so I think it's because of, like, enemy takes some risk, but sometimes it works, but sometimes it doesn't work.
So this is obviously Rainover talking about how, or one of the reasons Fnatic have been falling behind in some of the games we've been watching lately, at least how they don't take any risk in the early game, meaning they allow your team to be proactive on the map, and that can often backfire for Fnatic, but they trust in their late game so much and timing these power spikes, then get back in the game. And yes, they have managed to pull it back, but it is not the style we used to see from Fnatic. It used to be very focused on making early plays, having this medium risk, high reward style. That's what they used at MSI. This composition for Fnatic is going back to that style. There is risk involved when you run a Riven top lane. So they're going back, abandon what has been not the strongest for Fnatic the last few weeks, enough to win. But now we're going back to the Fnatic style we know. Huni on a carry that can really snowball out of control. Twisted Fate pick against Pokecomps, I said it before, I really like it. You can create picks, you have wave clear, you have split pushing, and that is all you need to try and shut down these Pokecomp positions, because they want a 5-on-5 sit and shoot you in the face. You won't let that happen in a 1-3-1 setup.
It's been such a long time since these two teams have faced off against one another as well. Week 2 was the matchup. Despite the gold being pretty even, went relatively late game, you can see that 3 Barons for Fnatic. Nukeduck actually played a mid lane Irelia that particular match.
Yeah, and it was a game where Rocket fell really far behind. And then Fnatic overextended in a few fights around Baron, funny enough, which allowed Rocket to get back in the game. But they still kept it cool on Fnatic's side. It's something they talk a lot about, how they're getting mentally very strong. They can fall behind, they can keep it cool, they trust in Yellowstar shot calling. and that's enough to pull them back. And then the coordination in these late game team fights is just spot on for Fnatic, and that's what they used against Rocket to secure that win. They're looking to do the same obviously here.
And we did see Rocket are the ones that started this lane swap. Sent their duo up top.
Lane swap against the Riven.
Who has been holding hands with Reignover. And Jankos is Gragas this split. 1-2, lost 2. Slightly higher kill participation. Jankos is also one of those junglers who's continuing to impress and continuing to grow in summer, despite having a shaky spring and a shaky start at the beginning of the split.
So we're going to see a 4v0 from Rocket because they've already cleared most of their own jungle, and Fnatic managed to steal away front of their own red buff up on the top side, even though the dual lane from Rocket was there. But Fnatic is going to the standard one we've seen now. Three members pushing with the top layer. That's the key thing. You're going to notice how Huni is going to stay in the bottom lane once the tower goes down. They're going to give him the wave. He's going to bounce it back towards himself. Look how they give him full gold as well from the tower, because he's the key member here to get rolling. So even though it's a swap, he only gets denied in the start, and Fnatic can then even go in and take a dragon for themselves. So now Huni is going to look to shove this wave back to himself. Rocket sacrificing Steve a little bit to send him down to this bottom lane. Normally you would see Rallus and Vanda go down here and shove out the wave. Really risky for Rumble to go. Oh, you can see they're actually coming after. So they're sending him, he's scouting.
Scouting ahead with that teleport available. Okay, dragon picked up by Fnatic. Early advantage in CS and XP for Huni, as is customary. Rocket fan there in the... Hang on. That's double dipping. You can't have a Rocket face tattoo and a Fnatic hoodie on. That's cheating. But nevertheless, someone
smart,
will
man.
Win.
You're going to be happy no matter what happens.
Okay, but maybe it's intelligent. It's intelligent fandom.
Rocket right now, what are they doing with Steve? He should have been sitting top lane, had the wave bounce back. Look at how many minions up there are building up from Fnatic. All of that could have gone into the pocket of Steve. Instead, they swapped them, but they're fast pushing with Steve as well, so he's not getting a lot of XP, he's not getting a lot of farm. Instead, they're using him to try and take down two very quick out of turrets. They might be looking for a very early group around NukeDog as well in this virus, but Steve just lost so much potential farm in the top lane.
What is this going to mean in the bigger picture? Fnatic,
it means he's going to die even harder if he wants 1v1s the Riven.
All right, what is Rocket's next move? They've almost fully committed to this. Once again, Steve is not the man getting the XP, is not the man getting the tower gold. Continues to fall further behind Huni. Let's see what Yellowstone Reckless do once this tower goes down. Will they donate tower number two to Huni? It looks like that might be the case.
Yeah,
sure.
I mean, they can do the same again. So Fnatic is playing around the top laner. Rocket is playing around the AD carry at this point. It's Mr. Rallus who's finishing the towers. He's the guy that tried to smack gold into and say, like, you need to get to your BF sword really, really fast so we can start grouping with you. But it does mean that Steve is not going to be able to show his face one-on-one against Huni. He's going to have to sit far back. You can see once again the wave is here. Huni's going to pick it up. Already a difference in farm. Obviously, Rumble is a champion that requires less gold to be impactful. However, I feel like with this new patch, where Rylai's and Liandry's are so strong, investing gold into your Rumble is honestly worth it, because if he hits that two item spike, that's so powerful on him right now, but that's going to be very delayed with the way Rocket has played this lane swap. You can see Reignover was staying around. If Steve shows, we'll just go gank him.
Flash is available for Huni. May see some toying. Steve is going to kill the tower off, and Reignover is going to recall. Jankos was nearby if anything were to break out. Now the two towers are down, both top and bottom. We'll catch a brief glimpse of Febivin and NukeDuck. We've not talked about them at all yet, Deficio. Febivin's already backed and picked up those Ionian Boots of Lucidity. If there was ever more of a sign that he wanted to help push those side lanes, maybe Huni's lane many times over,
yeah,
that might be it. And of course, NukeDuck with a traditional tier into Longswords.
Two options then for Febivin. Either he goes Morel Normicon second, he maxes out cool limit option, and he just becomes such a strong wave clear machine, and then also with the lower cooldown on ulti, or he can go in for Lich Bane as his first major item, and then he has more tower pushing potential in that sense if he's sitting in that 1-3-1 setup anyway. Fnatic, what they're looking to do later is swap Rek'Sai and Yellowstar into the mid lane, because that enables Yellowstar to start roaming with Reignover, and Alistar is such a strong champion again at setting up tower dives. So if you have a Reignover, sorry, a Reignover, a Riven pushing in one lane, a TF in the other one, those lanes are going to be pushed in very easily. And then Alistar comes in with the Rek'Sai, and you just pick whatever lane you want to dive, and there's so little counterplay for Rocket, unless they can start grouping with the Pokecoms. I wonder if that was the strategy. Snowball Caitlyn into a BF sword, group up with the Varus, and then don't allow Fnatic to split push.
It didn't work
out. I don't
out.
Really agree with it at all, though, because Hoon is just so far ahead.
Well, Mr. Alls has already backed earlier, picked up that pickaxe. So we're rushing for that one. We're getting closer to 10 minutes on the clock in this lane swap. In Fnatic's four lane swaps that they've played, they've averaged 1.2 thousand gold in the lead. For Rocket, in the six lane swaps, they've actually averaged 300 gold down. So we're looking closer to the averages of Rocket. Fnatic, not made any plays necessarily, other than pushing those waves out and making sure Huni has got a level advantage, 6-5. He's got a CS advantage, 30 more CS.
And this is what we're gonna do.
Steve is in trouble, gold card connects, the knockup comes out. Reignover's first blood.
I mean, you don't give Steve any farm. You might get Yellowstar though.
Yellowstar gets caught out. Pulverize comes down, but where is the damage? Forced to flash away. We did see Rek'Sai being shielded by the tower. So Rocket gave up first blood on the player that they have surrendered for damage on two towers. And Fnatic may even get that inner turrets.
I see what NukeDog is doing though, trading with Pepperman.
Well, seems to be winning that trade quite heavily, but did need to use the Chain of Corruption. Ace in the hole!
Almost, but nice setup. Very greedy pathing from Pepperman. Just walked through his lane into NukeDog. Gets poked down, dies for it. This is what Rocket wanted to do. Early outer turrets down so they could start rotating to mid lane with Rallis. He should have that BF sword once he goes back to base with tower going down, the kill as well. That is what they were looking for. Can Rocket then continue grouping and start pushing at tier 2 towers? Or will Huni be such a big problem they always have to worry about? Like, look at Pepperman here. Just casually walking back to his tower, being like, oh, hey, NukeDog, you're there. Oh, I'm getting chunked down. And Rylus just walks in and is like, oh, the flash is so close. Just not enough.
Kill secured. That means Mr. Rylus has got boots and a BF sword. Rocket and Fnatic are even in towers, but Fnatic have that extra dragon and 1,000 gold thanks to some CS that's been picked up. We do see early home guards and Sheen picked up for Febivin, as well as distortion boots for Huni. So TP flash plays.
Huni doesn't even need to go for any early resistance. He knows he's just that far ahead in the lane. So early penetration, obviously. Cooldown reduction, fantastic on the Riven. And we know what Fnatic is going to do. 1-3-1, collapsing with TP and with the Twisted Fate. 5v5, but you just get into the backline so quickly. Vander is going to have to play a perfect game if he wants to protect Rylus and NukeDog.
Well, Krepo showed me a perfect Thresh setup. Turning around a teleport gank. Not going to have the same tools in Janna, but similar levels of disruption. Dragon number 2 has been started at 11 and a half minutes. Rocket are nearby, and Steve has teleport. Plus a ward in the pit. Teleport's being channeled in the river, but it'll be too late for the Dragon. Rocket are now grouped up. Chain of Corruption from NukeDog, not even going to be fired. Equalizer does, and Fnatic get away clean. Little bit awkward.
Yeah, strange from Rocket. If they wanted to fight for that one, they had so much time to set up that TP play from Steve and move in. But NukeDog was also on the other side of the Dragon, and it's very key that Rocket does not move away from Vanda. Again, he's your mom. He's the guy who's going to save you from the bullies that are Fnatic. If you stand far away from him, or her in that case, you're gonna die. So, somewhat weird setup from Rocket. Two dragons now for Fnatic, 12 minutes in, because they got the one lane swap. So that's gonna be very key going towards the five dragons very early on. Rocket though, we're back. We wanna push, we wanna poke. We wanna make sure we do it while Huni is still stuck with a wave at his own tier 2 tower, so we have so much time to build it up.
Okay, Deficio, you can see the gold values. 1,200 advantage for Huni with his 40 CS lead, but for all of the CS Huni has ahead, Reckless is in fact behind. Mr. Riles was the one that was given that priority early on. And it's on a Caitlyn. So that mid-game power trough will somewhat be balanced by the Trinity Force spike.
Right.
But
it still takes so long for Caitlyn to have impact on the game, unless she can continue to roll down these tier 2 towers, which has not been the case already for them, compared to what a Riven is going to do in the mid-game with the early farm she's been giving. So Fnatic obviously have their priorities correct here, saying we need Huni to have a great game. But Rocket was like, Steve, Steve, whatever, you can just get sacrificed. We're going to play around Mr. Rales. And that is such a risky strategy for them, because there's just nobody who can stop him. And Rocket,
a lot of hype built up for this Riven. We've not seen him find a fight yet.
They're running away from him.
Yet. Huni still farming up that top lane. We saw him involved in one of those tower dives. Got the assist onto Steve. The sacrificial rumble, or Yordle, if you will. The Mother Vanda is protecting Rocket in the jungle as they continue to clear the wards out. And Rocket, they're playing this grouping game. However, the key component of the group, Mr. Riles, is Caitlyn. Not there.
Not there, but Huni also is freezing the top wave. So Fnatic not looking to set up any pressure on the map at all. That has allowed Rocket to move into the jungle and establish this vision here. If there's a guy freezing, you know he's stuck in that lane. So that's a guy less you have to worry about. And Rocket used it well. Have to obviously remember, as you just said here, Riles with his Infinity Edge is not nearby. So if a fight breaks out, Fnatic's not really going to miss Reckless too much. He's level 7. Doesn't have a Trinity Force yet. Should be completed very soon, though. But this game is definitely not about him.
Right.
Even though they built these comms earlier around him, that's a difference now.
And that's Fnatic's prerogative, really, when they want to play. They can build around Febiven to carry. They can build around Huni to carry. They can build around Reckless to carry. And we've seen all of those respective styles of team compositions.
This is an MSI comp. Massive carry for Huni that can snowball out of control. Cassiopeia in a one. Now it's a Riven. Reckless or the AD carry on cleanup duty and wave clear.
I need to ask our stats guys to track Steve's CS numbers. 45 at 15. Will Fnatic shut Steve down as hard as they shut Oduwamne down a few weeks ago? When Fnatic want to single out a champion, they can. And of course, Rocket helped that cause, because they put Steve in the disadvantageous positions.
Fnatic needs to be careful, though. They don't invest too many members on the lane where Huni is pushing. They just walked in because they had a push drop to take the blue buff. But you have to respect the fact that Rocket is looking to group on your towers. And now, this is giving so much damage on it because Fnatic went for that blue buff. That's something they have to respect. Febiven and Reckless need to be ready to clear out the waves. They cannot go aggressive unless they get a kill, and Rocket is not in position to take anything.
Febiven took one of those aces in the holes early and is not enough of a bro to take it for Reckless this time. Rocket continue to group up, and the poke from Nuke Duck is being equalized by the wave clear. And Twisted Fate Fnatic. Febiven, rather.
A nice time.
Yeah, sorry.
Your wave clear.
And Fnatic hold onto their inner turret. So this tier 2 pressure has stalled out for Rocket. They are still 1,600 gold, and Steve's going to need all the bravery shields he can get. He's 70 CS down. Still farming towards that needlessly large rod, which is cheaper, but not cheap enough.
That is another good thing for Rumble, though. In the Hourglass, obviously when you build Hourglass, it's for the active of it, it's not for the AP, which is why having it cost less is an upgrade for a lot of champions. And that's always how I look at these new AP changes, is do we build the item for the AP, then it's annoying that it costs more? I guess you're happy then it gives more AP, but it's a bit annoying anyway in that sense. But if you build an item for the active, it's great, it costs less. Like, take Void Staff as an example. Why do you build Void Staff? Magic Penetration. So it costs more, but it gives more AP. Well, who cares? I want it for Magic Penetration, so I want it to cost less. So that's annoying. That's a nerf. This case, Hourglass, to me, that's a buff, especially for Rumble.
Really disappointed teacher today. 513's made Deficio angry.
I really like the patch. I mean, I'm reading it, I was like, oh boy, that's done a lot of prep.
Not a huge amount has changed. We're seeing very similar things, at least for the first week the patch has been out. Although, Challenger team did run Zyra mid. We'll talk about that if we ever see an LCS. For now, Fnatic on the Dragon. Rocket was slow to react last time. They're going to be slow to react this time. Maybe 2,000. Piercing arrow is going to come out. Rainover, not going to get it. Rocket, snipe away the Dragon.
Nice coordinated snipe. I think both Rylas and Nuke are fighting at the same time. Rainover getting a taste of his own medicine. He stole it with an Olaf axe. And now Nuke Duck snipes it away from Fnatic. But you could see how Rocket didn't want to commit to the fight because there were two guys on the flank, Fibbivin and Huni. So I had to just try and rely on the snipe. And that was so important. Three Dragons to zero at 18 minutes would have been
catastrophic.
Terrible. Disgustingly bad.
But it's not
annoying,
the case.
Annoying. But that is not the case. Because of the snipe. Reckless also right. Managed
Destiny
to get
Destiny has been used. Steve's been gold carded. Huni stunned him. Valor, Wind Slash, not even going to be needed.
I just want people to notice when Fibbivin is using his ulti. It's not just when Steve shows himself in the top lane. That is obviously step one. Step two is where are the minion waves when he's using it? Bot lane was pushed up by Reckless. Mid lane has been pushed up by Fibbivin himself. So Rocket was stuck near their own towers, which means they couldn't respond and take a tower on the other side of the map after the play happened. So he's timing the minion waves really well with when can Rocket make a play, so when can I make a play. Also means that Steve can never show himself if the rest of his team is standing too far back on the map. He can only show himself if they are already pushing up near a tower, so Fibbivin cannot leave. I might even be lying to you, because even if he shows himself against Huni, he's going to die. So Fibbivin.
100 CS is the difference for Huni as we're getting closer to 20 minutes. Fibbivin, I'm sure we'll get a replay of that.
Nuke Duck, it's been a bit of a bully.
So here's the replay.
Q ulti, yeah, beautiful.
Well, this is what we said in Picks and Bans. Nuke Duck's Varus. Oh! Nobody saw that, Feb. Except everyone saw that.
Yes, slowed down as well. Well, I mean, you don't need that flash. You have an ulti anyway. I like Nuke Duck though on Varus. He has impact in the mid game. You land a Q, followed by ulti, then you get another Q because your cooldown is so low. That's a very good, quick combo you can use. Then you also force them to flash into the wall.
Okay, so Teficio. Kill for Nuke Duck. That's 2-2 with Fnatic. We've crested 20 minutes. At 20 minutes, Steve at around 72, 76 CS. It's the second lowest against Fnatic of the split. This is the team fight. Twisted Fate is up. Febem is looking for the kill. Huni's going to Valor forward. Wind Slash plus one more wild card. Huni, the shield saves his life.
Once again, look at the minimap. Where is Rocket? They're standing super far back. They're standing at their own tower in the mid lane. So Fnatic knows there's zero response. Fibbivin uses ulti, can see is there anyone near the bottom lane. No, Steve is on his own. Big surprise, Rocket sacrificed him all game long. And you just pop down, you kill him. Again, if Rocket cannot be proactive on the map, and that's why I disagreed so much with letting Huni get such a big advantage and just sacrificing your own top laner, Rocket can never group them. Whenever Steve dies, Rocket can't group. If they're not in a position before he dies to take a tower, they're not going to gain anything.
And with those two kills that Fnatic have picked up, they are now 4,000 gold ahead of Rocket, despite the fact Steve has picked up that Zhonya's Hourglass. To finish the point, he had the second lowest CS at 20 minutes, all split long. That's of any top laner. Partially because of Fnatic, partially because of Rocket's team decisions. What it does mean is that Nuke Duck was able to pick up a CS advantage. All of the CS that Mr. Riles had over Reckless has now been evened out, and it's Fnatic's group that secures another tower.
Very well played around Huni and Fibbivin together. Remember, it's not about Reckless. He's just sitting here farming, wave clearing, taking down towers. That's his job. Keep feeding Huni. That is the mission. And now Mr. Rylas.
Gonna flash away, pulverize up. That's gonna interrupt the net. Reckless is looking for the kill as Rylas gets headbutted towards the wall. The Mother Vanda is not gonna be able to save Mr. Rylas' life. Will keep himself up. While that was going on, Steve got dropped underneath the tower. Here comes Jankos. A new challenger appears and it's super effective. Nuke Duck gets the kill. Wind Slash is thrown across by Huni for the damage and nothing else. Tower defended, 1-2.
Again, though, Fnatic with control of the map. They're the ones setting up the dives using the Alistar this time. Rallus was hoping for a headbutt from Yellowstar. That's why he could try and flash that one and get out of range then of the Q. But obviously, Yellowstar just waiting. Easy kill for him. Let's see it again. You can notice how Rallus, like, his only hope of surviving here is trying to flash a potential headbutt. Not gonna happen. Yellowstar saves it. They get the kill on Rallus. Vander tries to save him, but two guys already behind him. Steve ports in, and poor guy instantly dies. Rocket gets one kill in return, but it's the same again. Fnatic, they have the skirmish, they have the global. They're using it. They have the stronger one-on-ones, 2v2s. Rocket has the poke, but are never able to group and use it.
I see both of the coaches backstage, Daylor and Yamato Cannon, watching intently.
Serious faces.
Daylor, it's a matter of continuing the win streak and improving upon the fantastic foundations Fnatic have built. And for Rocket, now, it's pulling a Fnatic. Can they play from behind? Can they bounce back from a 5,000 gold deficit? The fourth dragon of the game has just spawned. And once again, Fnatic are here on point. Will Rocket be able to snipe it a second time? Not so confident.
We're gonna have to be so careful when they move in here. They might just want to try and trade it for a tower, or because look at Hoonies' position. If he moves in and gets a flank, the two carries are going to die, but
I guess you can
just steal it again.
Cyanide will be rolling in his grave. Because he once called Rainover out for stealing. Rainover was the one that was securing objectives, whether his or his opponent's. And now Rainover's been unable, as Jankos and Nukta have stolen away two dragons. But it does feel like there are small victories. Look at that gold difference. The 5,000 gold that Fnatic are ahead, 4,000 of it is because of Steve versus Hooney.
Talked about it in the early game.
We talked about it a lot.
We did. So that's why we don't want to talk about it anymore.
Okay.
Remove that gold. Instead, Fnatic. Twice now, dragon gets stolen. Could have had four dragons at 24 minutes. Do wonder if instead of taking that risk of Rocket stealing it, maybe they should be looking, instead of using Hooney, to go in for a flank in these fights here. But obviously Fnatic is saying we don't need to 5-on-5 when we can just keep using our split push advantage. But two dragons to Rocket, they can prove super important. Steve, not even the Crooks is his friend in this game. I don't think they're ever friends with anyone. You kill them all the time. But point is, everyone wants to kill Steve.
Well, they're nobody's enemy until you punch them in the face. Hooney, 230 CS. Last Whisper, Brutalizer, as well as the Tiamat. Ravenous Hydra completed. Upgraded trinkets for 3 of 5 Fnatic members. And we just constantly see Fnatic pushing out the waves. Now, they've dived Steve for what I'm going to say are easy kills. But for Fnatic, they also don't have the greatest of siege themselves. Using Hooney to split push, let's see how they can crack open the bases.
Well, you can see the position of for Rocket right now on the map. That allows Fabian to go bot lane again if he wants to and kill Steve again and take the tower. Seeing as Rocket is not in a position to make any plays for Rocket, this group of four members need to shove up the top lane. That's what Rallus is trying to do. And then try and group the mid lane and start pushing it up. Force Fabian to sit in a wave clear at a tier 2 tower. That's one of the ways you can maybe start landing some poke, but you still gotta respect the potential flank from Hooney. You have no control over the map. There's so many ways you can TP in, or you can just start the fight like this.
Vevevin's coming in. We see the gold corner. Nuke Duck, the Mother Vander's not gonna save the lives of Rocket again. Reckless has got a kill. A 3-man stun from the Keystrike. That's a huge team fight for Fnatic. Double kill for Hooney. Double kill for Reckless. And they're gonna peel for Baron.
Fnatic has been getting everything. We just mentioned how if you start grouping, Hooney can flank because Rocket obviously have so little control over the map. What happens? Fnatic start the fight. Hooney walks in. This is what I wanted them to do around Dragon instead of risking getting stolen, but I take it. This is fine. Such a good team fight for Fnatic. And I mean, yeah, Vander, you have a Monsoon, but that's not enough against so much CC coming in from Fnatic. Look at the fight here. First, Fabian comes in. Vander tries to disengage everything to save Nuke Dog. Mr. Rylance is not even close. He's running from the blue buff at this point. He's trying to shove out the wave. Three-man stun. Beautiful play. Didn't even have to use his teleport, so he now has that advantage as well.
That was exceptional.
I love watching Fnatic play with, when they have styles like this, when they play carries like this for Huni and play around him so well.
And the thing that's exceptional about this game, Fnatic committed all of their time and decisions into getting Huni ahead, and Rocket committed their time and resources in the early game into getting Mr. Rawls ahead.
Yeah, and he's still sitting on just two items.
And now Mr. Rawls is even with Reckless in CS, but behind in global objectives.
To be fair as well for Rawls, this is not about him as a player. This is more what Rocket could do as a team.
Yes, team decision, strategy. And Fnatic played it out perfectly. They've got Baron empowered minions. Look how far Steve is from Huni, showing full respect to that Riven. And this is going to allow Fnatic with those Baron empowered minions, with the Lich Bane and the Trinity Force, to kill towers once they get to them.
Three lanes pushing in. Buffed up minions everywhere. Decent wave clear from Rocket though, with the Varus, with the Caitlyn as well. But it's not even about that for them at this point. It's more the fact that Fnatic will keep pushing in these waves here. They will keep looking for opportunities. And it's just a matter of time before Febrin pops his ulti and kills Steve again.
Another tower secured for Fnatic. Huni, level 17 to level 13. Let that sink in for a second.
Okay.
160 CS lead. I don't even think the help of Nuke Duck will be able to turn the tides in Rocket's favor. Waves being pushed in here by the wave clear from Febvin. Reckless is Corki doing work in the top lane, and they're just, my guess is just waiting for a mistake.
They're slowly getting damage on the towers. That's one thing for Fnatic. Another thing is they're waiting for Rugged to maybe send four members to the top lane and then just go kill Steve instantly. Or they're waiting for Rugged to send multiple members down to stop Huni and then just go up to the top side and make a play. They're waiting for Rugged to make their move first. Otherwise, look at the bot lane tower, down to 50%, slowly but surely poking it down. Notice as well how it's Febivan sitting and controlling the mid lane, so he can very easily move between the lanes. Reckless is just on the other side lane, trying to shove it in over and over. So Reckless is running without a support, but there's so little distance between them and also the T of ulti, so it's more than fine.
Jungle camps secured on the way out. Baron has now timed.
This could have been Dragon number 5, by the way, for now he's going to take.
Right, thanks to the stealing abilities of Team Rocket Jankos. It allowed Rocket to at least prepare to fight another day. And they're this far behind. Might need to surrender now, or Fnatic will just take off at the speed of light.
Vander Jankos. Nuke Duck.
Unfortunately for Rocket, it's fallen apart as the game has progressed, because they were only a few thousand gold down. And then they stole some dragons. But unfortunately, it was the inner turrets. Fisher, you called it at the third minute. If Mr. Rawls does not get inner turrets with Caitlyn, that mid-game power trough will be too great for Rocket to overcome, and it's exactly what's happened. Fnatic have played their team composition and their macro-level strategy exquisitely.
We've seen one of the problems for Rocket all split long is whenever Rocket has to be the proactive team, they tend to struggle quite a lot making the aggressive plays. They like to more react to what you're doing, but there's no reaction to make to a Twisted Fate teleporting in with a Riven. Like, there's nothing you are going to do at that point, because even if you're setting up a trap, hello, Twisted Fate ulti is gonna spot you anyway, and they're just gonna be like, okay, we're not gonna go for it, and step away. Bot and tower going down now, slow and steady.
Nobody can contest Huni. You see that Valor shield with his Bloodthirster shield. So difficult to hurt Huni at this point, and then he's just going to sustain with all of the lifesteal. Steve, you got to be very careful, my friend. Giant's Belt plus Hourglass. Look at this. Febivan pushing top lane as the rest of Fnatic now have an opening into the base. Very clear they want to get supers to help out this continued siege. That's a flash forward from Yellowstar. He's got to the headbutt, pulverized. Destiny is being channeled from Febivan, and Steve is going golden in the middle of the fight. Febivan's been able to stay alive for a few seconds before they've traded lives, one for one. Inhibitors down, and Fnatic look like they'll be happy to escape. Chain of Corruptions onto Huni. He will get focused down. two for one at the cost of an inhibitor.
Very nice ulti from Nuke Duck here. That Rocket just managed to get away from Huni, then lock him down as well. Fnatic diving in while paying attention to the inhibitor at the same time. Got their inhibitor down at least. While the Lost Vice. That's a key thing for them. Open up the base. You got Super Minions coming. Baron is up in a minute's time. Steve is going to be a guy defending. So look at this here. Fnatic, what they want to do is obviously take the fight, force Rocket away. Worst case, you just take Inhibitor. But nice ulti from Vandal to split up everything. Jankos follow in as well, knocking Febiman into the tower. Huni doesn't manage to use his ulti for anything, really. So it's a good fight for Rocket. And notice how Huni's trying to go back in. The reaction from Rocket, locking him down, gets another kill for himself. Too little, most likely too late, though.
Super Minions and 14,000 gold. QSS now secured for Huni as well to shake off that chain of corruption. And just such a difficult place to be. There's 30 seconds on the clock before Baron comes up. And even though Steve has teleport, they would really have to surprise Fnatic. They wanted to challenge for this next Baron. You can see Huni gonna peel away to this middle lane, using those broken wings to clear some distance and finish the wave with a quick up. Deficio. For Rocket, it's now hoping Fnatic make a mistake. For Fnatic, play safe for Baron and then push down top.
Yeah.
Let supers do the work, let the Baron of our minions help, and on track for another sort of average game length victory.
It's a joy to shot call when you are almost 15,000 gold ahead of the other team. Because there are just barely any wrong calls to make. You are a Fnatic, so push down this top wave. You have the buffed up minion. Twisted Fate, you cannot leave him alone. He's going to destroy your tower. He has a Lich Bane, Death Cap, everything. So Rocket needs to create a pick somehow on Fnatic. That is the only way for them back in the game. I'm looking at Nuke Duck. He's going to be the guy to do it. Sniper target, land the ulti.
Well,
but I mean,
Huni's got one tower. Fnatic got the next. Top inhibitors being focused by Huni. Rocket have made no decision. Barrel's going to go and actually knock Fnatic to safety. Steve's going to try burn down Rainover, but Huni should be able to get that top inhibitor in any second now. It's dropped, as we said. Fnatic take another inhibitor. Super Mini is now on the bottom lane. Look at that shield from Huni when he uses his E. Going to take a couple of autos from Mr. Rolls. BT shield, Valor shield, all the shields. Chain of Corruption goes out. It does connect on Feb, but then he's going to be forced to use the Hourglass. Now, Jankos has already used his Explosive Cast. Two very important ultimates used. Fnatic are even going to use the Empowered Recalls and their Destiny to get back and continue the siege. It's just about running interference.
Got all the Super Minions coming. Feb is going to rejoin as well. Rocket doing the best they can to hold off, but Fnatic, they're just playing it safe right now. They want to make sure this is going to be the push.
Seems to be the case. Rocket, Super's coming in. There's the gate. Febiven, he's joining the fight. Monsoon's up for Vanda as a little form of disengage, but that is it. Gold card will take the tower out. Piercing Arrow not going to connect, nor will the Fat Man body slam. For a slow and steady finish, Fnatic waiting for the Supers to get in. PvE almost. Rocket may as well not be involved.
Yellowstar
misses the engage. Huni's looking for more. He gets cast underneath the laser. Rocket get a kill, but they will lose their Nexus. Fnatic remain undefeated at 15-0.
Just a very clear game plan for Fnatic coming into the game. You're running a poke composition. We need wave clear with our last pick. That's going to be a Twisted Fate because that can also help snowball our Riven even harder, which was the whole strategy. We saw the lane swap. People will go back and rewatch it. Notice how Yellowstar and Reckless are always leaving the tower just when it's about to go down. Give the full amount of gold to Huni, where Rocket was the complete opposite. It was Steve leaving. Give it over to Mr. Rallis. Steve lost the entire wave top. He gained nothing. He got 162 CS. That is three more than Rainover managed to get in this game here. Huni, 359. Two items completed for Steve. Huni almost full build. Such a big difference in priority. Obviously, you could see what Rocket were trying to do, saying, we know the Rumble is not going to hold him, his own in a one-on-one, so we're just going to try and build around the 280 carries and get this early group going. But then they didn't control the minion waves like Fnatic did, and we just saw pick after pick after pick, and then when you have a Pokemon falling behind like that, there's nothing you can do.
Such a difficult game for Rocket and for Fnatic. Truthfully, they didn't even need the power of Riven. Just the big sign that said, beware. You know, like when you go to, you walk past somebody's house, you see, beware of dog.
Yeah.
That's what it's like, beware of who needs Riven. They just waved that around, and Rocket like, nope.
I feel like Steve walked up there a few times anyway.
Won't get involved. Okay.
I'm just going to see what happens.
And exceptional leadership, decision making, a phrase that Yamato Kanno was talking about from the analyst desk, saying, you know, you can't necessarily